Monday, Cody and Gold, Alex Gold, Cody Tapp, Drew Nixon with you. Hope everybody had a fantastic weekend. I think this will be the first radio show I could speak for all of us that I've done right in the middle of an eclipse. I don't think I was not on the air live. Our show back in 2017 or whatever had just ended. We were just actually it was before our show had even begun at that point in time when I was at another station, another city. But this time we've got an eclipse going on during the show. You guys ready?
It's happening live during the show. It'll complete right at the end.
Yes. 12:37 is when it starts the eclipse. You won't really notice anything yet, but 12:37, and it actually fully ends at 3, like 10 or 3:11. But you're right. 1:54 is when we'll get 89% of an eclipse. We don't get the perf. We're not in
We got
Arkansas.
That last time. Yeah. You know what? I already got that in 2017. I don't need the 100%. 90% seems nice.
Oh, I think it'll be good, but it's still a rare thing. I know we had one recently, but the next one in the continental U.S. is like 2044, I think.
But I could just travel. I could be like one of those people who gets on like airplanes just to go see the eclipse.
People are flocking to like Hot Springs, Arkansas from all around the world because that's like one of the best spots. So we'll see. This could be, you know, everything could just fall apart at 1:54. We don't know, you know? The show could just end. The station could get knocked off the air. People thought the world was ending this weekend with the earthquake as well. So who knows what's going to happen? Enjoy this show, you know?
Man, I don't want to work if the world's going to end. You guys do it. I'll go enjoy my... Well, look, if the world doesn't end, I just come back to work tomorrow. Seems fine. And if it does, I didn't spend my last few hours on this earth doing this show.
No advance notice needed, by the way. I don't want advance notice. If something...
Wait, if the world's going to end, why not?
I don't think... Chaos is why.
So if there was an app that would tell you the day you would die, you wouldn't want to know it?
That's the million-dollar question, isn't it?
Because if it's a week from now, dude, you might as well live your best life.
So that's different. Individually, I think I would. But if... I don't think you would. You can't. No, that would be chaos. If everybody knew the world was ending. Now, if you're talking about your individual life, this is a very dark start to the show.
We're talking about death on the show all the time.
Damn.
Would you tell other people? So let's just say you knew. I got an app. It's 100% accurate. It tells me the day I'm going to. It's just me. No one else in the world is going to get this luxury. Just I am going to know when I die. Do I share that with other people? Let's say I know I die at 78. I know the day. Do I warn other people it's coming?
I think it depends.
Or just take care of my business and then just die.
My guess is the answer is different for those that have have family and kids like yourself versus someone like that doesn't have, you know, a big family or it's just them.
I wouldn't say anything until
load up on the life insurance before I can tell that.
Until
I'm
going
to make sure everyone's taken care of if I'm getting ready to go down.
Sure.
I don't think you should say. I don't think you would say. I wouldn't want to say anything until like a couple months before. Like, hey, by the way, I know that.
But imagine that conversation, Drew. Hey, by the way, I know in exactly 37 days I'm going to die.
So we need to have a heck of a 37 days. Yeah, that's what it needs. I wouldn't want to know because I think it discourages you. If you know that you're going to die at 80, it discourages you from really living your life to the fullest until maybe 50 or 60, I think.
No,
until
but you like, really oh, you think you just kind of like, just go through the motions for a little bit here now.
I think so, yes.
Yeah, but if you found out you knew you're unfortunately, hey, you only had till 45, well, then you're having a completely different outlook.
You need to step it up right now. Yes.
I'm going to figure out how much debt I can accrue versus life insurance I can get on the other side. I'm about to live my best life.
Forget generational wealth for my kids.
If I'm dying at 45, that's 6 years from now. I'm going to get maximum life insurance. My kids are going to be fine. I'm going to get $10, $20, $40 million in life insurance coverage.
I'm just imagining someone just now turning into the show and what the hell are they talking
about?
What
a start.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Talking about that. It's the eclipse day. It's an eclipse day.
It is an eclipse day.
In the 1 o'clock hour, we'll talk more about that as we shall see the text line 913-586-7610. We will get into that later. We will also obviously talk about the signing that occurred after our show on Friday and what it means for the Chiefs defense in particular going forward as they re-sign Mike Dana. But we start with these Royals, baby. The Royals sweeping the White Sox. We joked about being greedy on Friday. You know, 3 of 4, that's greedy. Not greedy enough. The Royals get the sweep of the White Sox, and they're over 500 for the first time, two games over, but for the first time since April 10th of 2022.
So 2 years ago.
Think about that.
2 full years ago, and I guess a couple of days, but 2 full years ago?
There were a lot of stats that were wild. Just to, it puts everything in perspective of just how bad this has been in Kansas City baseball wise for quite some time. I know Vern was putting out more and more stats. Like the Royals won a third straight game and now fourth. But at that point in time, the Royals didn't win a third straight game in 2023 until the final game of July. I don't know when the last time they won four straight. I don't know if it was during that same stretch or not, but July of last year was the last time they had won three in a row. So yes, it's an awesome start to see they're off today. Unfortunately, kind of stinks. Keep the momentum going here a little bit.
Yeah. You never do like the off day when a team's cruising a little bit and you're like, okay, things are going now. Let's keep this going. But I mean, you have to feel really good about this start. And I'm not saying it means the Royals are winning 85 games this year. I want to be there. I really do. Vern had correctly pointed out something I hadn't thought about, which is this team actually had the best record in the American League in 2021 in April. Did you know that? In April of 2021, the Royals started with the best record in the American League. They were 15-9, Gold. Like a very respectable number. They ended up finishing with 74 wins that year. So it seemed like a kind of inconsequential year. The big difference, though, for why I would buy in more this time, and I'm sure I bought in then too. Let's just face reality. I don't remember now, but I probably did. But the reason why it would be more likely to buy in now is they're young. Like all the players, Bobby Witt Jr. is playing great. MJ's playing great. They reworked their entire pitching staff. And a lot of them are still at least youngish, right? Singer's not that old. Reagan's is not that old. You know, I understand they got Lugo and Waka and some guys that are a little bit up there. But they rebuilt a pitching staff that seems to be on pace to be, I guess, the five top finishers of the Cy Young, so it turns out. I don't know what the hell happened. But there's like things that will last. That's what feels different about this. There are things that sustainably should last most of the year.
I mean, we went back through and looked at 2021 and the rotation and some of the pieces. I mean, at that point in time, you had Brad Keller and Danny Duffy still getting innings. You had Mike Minor in the rotation. I mean, there's just a different level of belief with some of the young pieces that are performing right now and what's stable and what's real versus maybe some of the results you were getting at that point in time. And you take a look and you see what the division's doing, and you don't want anybody to get hurt because you know you're going to have your own injuries as well. But you know, Shane Bieber for the Guardians is now done for the season. That's a huge blow to a Cleveland rotation, and Bieber's one of the best pitchers in baseball. And so, you know, that those are the kind of things you wonder, like, how did things open up for you across an entire season? And it's so early still. It's April 8th, but you need some breaks along the way. Like, the Guardians are in first place right now. I think they're 7-2. But the bar for this team this particular year, and certainly the month of April, is so low. You know, the people are reasonable. Expectations will continue to grow as we get further into this. But right now, I think the baseline thing is, at one point, 500 month of April. I'm sure later on this month, if the Royals keep winning like this, we'll get greedy and we'll say, a winning month of April is what you expect now. But that
I'm not quite
not,
there.
That's what I'm saying, not yet. But people will get there.
I would like another
week or so of being above 500. People will start to get there.
Well, their next nine games are against the teams who are combined as it currently sits 7-21. So, I mean, just straight up not good teams, because they got three more against the White Sox in Chicago in a week. But Houston is off to a very bad start. Who they're 3-7. They've got for the next three games. And then they've got the Mets, who are, I think, have three or four wins themselves, also off to a terrible start. So there's plenty of optimism around it. Look, the truth is, they'll keep winning at an incredible rate if the starting pitching is just going to do this all year.
Yeah.
And it can't. It can't. It's just not even physically possible for the starting pitching to pitch at this level all the time. The worst start they have gotten the entire year was yesterday, in which Alec Marsh was unable to get out of the fifth inning, I think.
Yeah, I think four and a third, maybe.
And allowed three earned runs. And the White Sox seemed like they might have finally got one on the Royals. And then they gave up a home run to MJ Melendez. And then they lost that one, too. That was the worst start they got all year. Alec Marsh had been their worst starter, the fifth guy. Logical. He has two starts. The team is 1-1 in his starts. And he's got a 3.09 ERA. Seems fine. That's the worst. That's the worst of the starters. I don't know how long. I mean,
actually, aren't they 2-0 in his starts?
Oh, they might be. Yeah, you know,
I think they're actually 2-0. So even though he hasn't been credited for, I think they're 2-0 because those are the Orioles.
Yeah, you're right.
So they've been able to win games like that. We'll talk about MJ Melendez separately in about 20 minutes or so, because he has been sensational and clutch, to say the least, in these big time moments for them. I also think, Cody, when you're taking a look at this particular weekend, for those that want to say, hey, look, the White Sox suck, so don't go too excited. You know, the difference is, though, in previous years, or depending on how you view the teams of the past, that's a bad team. A, you were that bad team, but B, you would have lost the series, you know, because it would have been like, how did you let a bad team get the best of you? That, to me, this weekend was a reason to show that you should look ahead and see where this team is at, that they beat up on a team that clearly is worse than them. That's what you're supposed to do.
Yep.
Not saying you're supposed to sweep the White Sox all year, but like, you're supposed to get the better of teams that you're just flat out better than. And going to the series on paper, they were. It was obvious. And they actually went out and did it. That's a step in the right direction, because in the past, either they've been the White Sox in that situation, mm-hmm. or they just have, you know, laid an egg in a series like that. No, they went out and found a way to win four in a row against a divisional team, no matter how bad they are. That is a big step in the right direction.
The White Sox might only legitimately have one above-average major leaguer. That is Garrett Crochet, who started for them yesterday, and they still won. And look, he was great.
He leads the big leagues in strikeouts.
They didn't lose the game because of Crochet, by no means, and nowhere close to it. But I know that, like I said, like, the starting pitching can't continue to do this way. But like, let's just look at the fundamental things of like why it's working. Okay, they got young hitters who are hitting. Everybody but Vinny in the top six of the order, five of the order, are hitting. Okay, look, I'll just tell you right now. Six hitters are not going to hit together at the same time all together. So great. One guy's not hitting, moving on, the rest are. The starting pitching was revamped. And then the bullpen, after a rocky, the reason why they're 6-4 and not 7-3 or 8-2 is because the bullpen had a rough first week where things didn't go their way. Over the last couple of games, they're making sure these close games are still wins. The Royals aren't blowing people out of the water, but they have the fourth best run differential in baseball. Like, that is a key stat. We talk about this all the time with football. Like, you might not like analytics from a purely, like, what, but there are a couple of stats that are always good predictors of winning. DVOA is one of them for football. Run differential is that for baseball. If you are a good run differential team, odds are you're a good baseball team. They're fourth in baseball. Like, I mean, and I get it. They got an 11-0 game.
Pitching, yeah. I mean, that's what's key there. I mean, that stat still just tells me how good their pitching has been.
Yeah, it's been really good. Well, they've gotten timely
hitting. I mean, that's also
only
the
from MJ, which I know we're going to talk about here again in a minute, but not only from MJ, but specifically from him.
So yeah, we will get back to the Royals throughout the show today, and then last night, everybody, I think, if you were maybe settling in for the night a little bit, and mm-hmm. you're like, okay, we're looking ahead, we think we have a good idea what we're going to be talking about on Monday, and then there started to be some rumors out of Lexington, Kentucky. At first, you're like, okay, is this a fake account? That was my first reaction. I'm like, no, who's it? Wes Moore. He's a TV reporter in Lexington, and nobody nationally is reporting
Kudos
it.
To him.
And give him credit. He had the scoop, and he's like, no, Arkansas is finalizing a deal to get Coach Cal Perry to leave, and now everybody's reporting it. Now it's pretty much a done deal. Coach Cal is leaving Kentucky for Arkansas. It's just that right there. You're like, what? Hold on. Wait. Explain how this thing's going to work. You dive into it deeper, and it actually makes more sense. He was likely, as we discussed during the tournament, playing for his job, or coaching for his job, I should say, this next season. Like, if they would have been out before the Elite Eight, I would have argued, this next year, Kentucky might have fired him. And so you're in that position. The fan base hates you. Like, you go, I mean, that's not even, they can't stand him anymore. They want him gone. They're happy that he is leaving for Arkansas.
Sure.
And so if you're Cal, you don't have an opportunity to get out of that. And then based on reporting, Arkansas, we know there's plenty of money tied in there with the Walton family. And I think the owners of Tyson Chicken, I believe, also are one of the big boosters or whatever. Yeah. And so they're like, hey, for you,
nugget magnates drawing in Coach Cal.
For you, we'll give you the big NIL budget. Reports are over $5 million. And so
plus Jerry Jones.
So, yeah, Jerry Jones is obviously an alum. So you think about the financial element and the support that he's going to have there. So he stays in the SEC and he goes to Arkansas, who's been to two Elite Eights in the last 5 years. And now the trickle down effect is the fun part. Like, because the stunner is, yeah, you're going to Arkansas, but the trickle-out effect is where it gets really interesting, and who the hell is going to Kentucky now?
Do you know, and we can talk about that in just a second, do you realize how toxic your situation had to have gotten to leave Kentucky? I was really trying to think about this. I cannot think of a single instance in the history of college basketball where someone left a top 10 program in any sport. And if they left, didn't just go to another top 10 program. Look, so Roy Williams left a top 10 college basketball program. to go to North Carolina.
His alma mater.
Yeah, his alma mater and another top 10 college basketball program, right? Makes sense. Those things track. You could see why a coach, like, let's just even say, I don't think it's going to happen, but like Bill Self left because Kentucky fans will get it mixed up in their brains if they could get him. At least if he left, it would be for another top 10 blue blood college basketball program. It makes sense. Leaving for Arkansas is crazy. It's crazy. That's never happened in the sport before. That seemed like there was no chance. That was a real story when it first started coming. You're like, what? Calipari, was he trying to get a raise? He's trying to get some more job security at Kentucky.
Well,
he's really going to take the job at Arkansas. He must have hated working there.
He's going to get more job security at Arkansas, and he's going to get more money through NIL, which we know is very important to build up the program. And you, to me, you'll get, if you're Arkansas, you'll get the best out of him now, because you know he's extra motivated going over to Arkansas. And if you're Kentucky, like, you're still going to land a top tier coach. But it's interesting, you know, the expectations are just so nuts. And that's why if you're the names that are already being mentioned, Nate Oates at Alabama, Scott Drew at Baylor, those are two of the names right out of the way. And, you know, then there's the dream candidates. Oh, they can get Dan Hurley to leave UConn. And UConn might win their second.
I saw someone suggest they might try to get Jay.
Yeah, I was going to say Jay Wright. Not leaving retirement. He's feeling pretty good in the
studio. He does look pretty comfy.
In the studio. He does a nice job on CBS for that. I just, yeah, you're right. We don't normally see a circumstance like this, but all of a sudden, I always wonder what Eric Musselman is thinking. So Musselman leaves Arkansas, Drew, to go to USC, and he likes the West Coast anyway. Okay, fine. But knowing it's not just that they're willing to pay the next guy more money than they were willing to pay you. That happens all the time in coaching.
Sure.
But they're willing to commit to NIL and stuff. So, like, the same donors that seem that they liked you, you know, like the Walden family, like, sure, we'll support your program. We think you're a great coach. That same family's now, like, willing to double the NIL budget for the next guy. You got to be like, wait a second.
They didn't believe in you as much as they do for...
Which, look, Cal's one of the best coaches in college basketball history.
I think that this job, it's interesting. It's a little bit different, obviously, because Calipari's not retiring, and it's not like he is clear-cut the GOAT of college basketball coaching. But I think there's a lot of parallels between the UK job and Alabama's football job because of the pressure that you mentioned, Golden, that we're going to, like, Nate Oates, what does he have to gain by going to Kentucky other than Cody, and you said this on the bullpen, being labeled as saying you were a coach at Kentucky.
That is juice. I'll just say that, like, it's like being the coach of Alabama. You could be like, well, this job's just as good, but it's not Alabama. It's not Kentucky, you know,
sure.
Like, there's still some weight in, like, the pantheon of like college athletics. You'd be like, I was the coach at Kentucky. I mean, that's one of the biggest programs in college basketball history.
Not everybody's made, you know, is willing to or can handle that. The big reason why Cal is leaving is because the fan base got toxic and he was worried about, you know, maybe getting fired in a year or so. And so, on one hand, it's weird. We're saying, well, you can't turn down Kentucky. Yeah, but we also never thought someone would leave Kentucky either.
No.
So it goes hand in hand. And, like, Nate Oates is 40, I think he's 49 years old. Does he think there's another blue blood type program that can open up in the next 5 years? That's what he has to estimate going forward. If he thinks somehow another blue blood is opening up, because otherwise, yeah, this is probably your only opportunity to go coach at. If that's what his, I don't know what his goal is. For some guys, that is their goal, Cody. They want to get to the top of their level.
Well, and he made it to a Final Four for the first time in Alabama's history. Like, he's able to have the success.
Obviously, but is this as good as it gets?
But Bill Self made a Final Four in Illinois. It didn't stop him from taking Kansas.
Sure. Yeah, he obviously didn't win the whole thing. But I think that he's in a situation that he likes. And now he's the guy, technically, in Tuscaloosa who has the resume. Because DeBoer's gotten to a playoff and gotten there, but he hasn't.
Football is always going to be king of Alabama. I mean, I don't care who the hell you are. I mean, the football is always going to be.
But in terms of pressure, he didn't have any. He has nothing there, and he's able to do. I think the thing, too, about Alabama's situation is it's not like Kalen DeBoer was the number one guy. They went to Lanning. They went to Norvell. They went to multiple coaches before Lanning DeBoer. I think that that's what happens at Kentucky. Like, they're going to try Oates, though. They'll try Hurley. They'll try to hit the home run, but eventually they're going to have to settle for.
I think Chris Beard. That's my pick, by the way. My if we were betting as a show, and we each were picking a name.
Beard.
Beard. Even though he won't be the first or second choice, I to your point, I could see him end up being the guy because Oates says no. If I'm Hurley and I went back to back championships at UConn, I'll leverage Kentucky to get an even bigger raise at UConn, but am I leaving UConn? Yeah. I'm not.
No.
I mean, we already talked about it. They're borderline at blue blood anyway. For the last 20 years, they've been as good as any college basketball program in the world. Blue blood stuff sometimes is like, you got to do it for 40 or 50 or these like crazy numbers, but no college basketball program has been as good as them over the last 20 years. And so,
yeah, but you're right about the trickle down effect. Like somehow if Hurley actually left UConn and did go to Kentucky, then UConn's open. And so is that the job Nate Oates leaves for? Does he leave for UConn?
It's going to be a lot like college football.
You know, that's what's a lot of fun.
It's already weird enough. This whole thing, Kentucky lost its head coach because SMU hired away USC's coach. This is SMU's fault. Because somehow SMU started a train. Yeah. You know that like meme where that guy's pushing a tiny little stone? It's just a massive cataclysm at the end of a giant one. You're like, what? SMU hiring a coach somehow ended up with Kentucky losing Calipari? Look, some of the reports said he was trying to reach out to get the Ohio State job. But Ohio State, this is the whole thing.
Apparently, that just fell through at the end.
Well, I think the problem with Ohio State and some of these big football schools is you don't want to pilfer NIL money for basketball if you're a football school, you know? You don't want Coach Cal asking for NIL, more NIL money when that money should be going to, you know, massive football programs.
Oh, well, apparently, too, I think I saw this on, I don't know if it was The Athletic or On Three, but the amount of money that's going in NIL deals to players is a lot more in basketball than it is football because collectively, you're paying more money
to
five players than you are, obviously, across the whole team, where that budget is really important. When you're trying to get guys, whether it be in the portal or, and that'll be interesting too, to see if Calipari adjusts the way that he does things a little bit, instead of just getting five true freshmen, he dips into the portal a little bit. And I'd be interested to see what his number was at Kentucky. Like how much were they, or is he getting more resources in NIL through Arkansas than he was at Kentucky?
I think so. No, I think it sounds like that's part of it. That was maybe a little bit of the issue as well. Now, maybe Kentucky amps it up now because of now it's costing them their coach. Although, again, the fan base is in Kentucky. This is one of those moves where I think both fan bases are pumped. Like, we can argue whether it's the right feeling Kentucky fans should have.
Good luck to Kentucky.
Kentucky fans, I think, are thrilled that Cal's leaving and they're not going to have to pay him. And Arkansas fans, understandably so, are fired up. They thought, you know, with all due respect, we'll talk later. I mean,
they thought they lost a good one in Musselman, and all of a sudden
they were interviewing their top two candidates last Friday were Jerome Tang and Chris Beard, and now it looks like they're going to get in Calipari.
Well, the crazy thing, they offered Jerome Tang the job and Beard the job, essentially, it sounds like, and they both declined it, and now they get Cal instead. It's a weird trade-off.
But that goes back to the boosters who they're willing to give. Once all of a sudden you got a chance to land him, suddenly they're all willing to pony up more money than they were.
I wonder what they offered Beard and Tang in terms of resources.
No, not nearly what they're
offering him.
$2 million a year. I don't know. In NIL.
The report is that it's going to be $8 million salary potentially. And then I think another $7 million NIL.
Seven. That's crazy.
Which would make them one of the five biggest NIL.
I will say this just because it's funny to watch Kentucky struggle. Good luck to you, because I think Cal was the best option that they had. And if Cal goes to an Elite Eight next year and Kentucky still loses again with whoever they get, it's going to be the ultimate.
Wait till Cal goes back next year. He's coaching the same conference.
That's right.
He goes back to Lexington. Oh, the atmosphere. I mean,
Rupp Arena will be buzzing.
I mean, that'll be College Game Day or something that day. I mean, it'll be incredible. I mean, you want to talk about must watch? We'll talk about Caitlin Clark here at 11 o'clock or so. That will also be must watch. Coach Cal's first game back.
This is also where the NCAA tournament's always like, it's a randomizer. No, it's not. They'll be facing each other in like a second round game. They'll underseed or overseed.
Conference play already.
Of course.
But I would agree with you. If they weren't in the same conference, then 100%. I think because it's conference, they probably just like, well, we already know we're getting that guarantee.
They'll find a way to meet in the Sweet 16.
Ticket prices are going to be insane just for his return to Lexington. So it's not 100% official, but just about every big-time reporter is now saying this thing is happening. I just saw a few more reports in the last 10 minutes that two other players, freshmen at Kentucky, just entered the portal. So
not surprising.
Some of them are going to follow him to Arkansas, and then some, you know.
Good luck to Kentucky, because you are behind the eight ball.
Long term, they'll be fine.
It's funny because like Kentucky's down years are still different. Like this is how you know you're a blue blood. Be like, oh, Kentucky, they've just been in a rut. It's like they're going to the tournament every year. They're just losing early. Like
they were in the NIT a couple years ago though.
Yeah,
not that far back.
Gonzaga's a little bit better than them in recent history.
But no blue blood, right, Drew? Not a blue blood, though.
I'm just saying.
All right, getting back into that. By the way, that was the most obvious ever.
That's why I passed on.
Up next, we'll talk some Chiefs football. One player coming back on that defense, what it means for the contracts of others moving forward. And we'll talk more about MJ Melendez, who might be getting set to have a breakout season.
Hey, it's Vinny Pasquantino.
Don't forget to follow Cody and Gold on the Odyssey app so you can listen on demand to my terrific football takes throughout the year right here on 610 Sports Radio.
Brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
You're trying to keep a good impression on your business, and that starts with your parking lot. My friends over at Gann Asphalt and Concrete are celebrating 30 years in Kansas City, locally owned and operated, so you know you're dealing with people right here in the Kansas City area. They're one contractor, all things parking lot. It doesn't matter which part of the project you need taken care of. Look, if it's just a teardown, you got to bring the thing down, start from scratch because you've delayed maintenance, let it go too long, and it's kind of, they can take care of that for you. But if you just simply need to fix your crumbling curbs or your uneven sidewalks or the striping needs to be taken care of or just the drainage is bad, they can take care of all of those things as well. Don't let the first impression of your business be a bad one. And instead, make sure that when they pull into your business, they feel like you're taking care of things. That's where Gann Asphalt and Concrete can help you take care of those things. I always suggest you go to gannandasphalt.com so you can see for yourself what people say about their business and why they love working with them. There's a reason why a local company like this has been serving the Kansas City community for 30 years. Go to GANNAsphalt.com and tell them that Cody sent you.
Choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertisements.
Paid for simulated client portrayal.
I'm attorney Mike DePasquale. When you call my law firm after your car wreck, you're our number one priority.
I got hurt in a car wreck and dealing with the insurance company was awful. My boss suggested I call Mike and his team. They took the burden off my shoulders and made me feel like I was their number one priority.
Call me. I've got this.
Mike's got this. All you need to know. 816-888-7500. Mike's got this.
The future of medicine is here at QC Kinetics. QC is the nation's leader in the most exciting revolution in pain management we've seen in decades, regenerative medicine. If your joint pain is keeping you from doing what you love, you need to call QC Kinetics now. Surgery, steroids, drugs, these are no longer your best options. Regenerative medicine at QC Kinetics is transforming lives with innovative treatments that deliver lasting results. QC Kinetics is under the leadership of National Medical Director Dr. Mitchell Scheinkup. Dr. Scheinkup is a pioneer in this field with 20 years of clinical work, and he wants to get you relief with a needle, not a knife. So call QC Kinetics now to learn more about some exciting options. This is a revolutionary approach that can get you long-term relief with no downtime. Call QC Kinetics now for a free consultation. 816-412-6299. That's 816-412-6299. QC Kinetics off 435 in State Line and in Gladstone. 816-412-6299.
It's Rawhide Harley's Keep the Same Payment event. Trade your bike up for a brand new 2024 Harley with no money out of pocket and keep the same payment. Finance specialists are on site to get you approved only at Rawhide Harley.
On approved credit and some.
This is Larry Ryan at Ryan Lawn and Tree. Those local Ryan pros in the clean red trucks are employee owners, recruited from the best college horticultural programs in the country. They want to make your lawn the best looking lawn on the block. Schedule your free estimate at ryanlawn.com.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential, but finding those people can be a major hassle, unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze. And right now you can try it for free at ziprecruiter.com/free. With ZipRecruiter, one click sends your job to hundreds of top job sites. But more than that, ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies the candidates with the skills you need, sends you a list of great matches to review, then actively invites them to apply for your job. And the results speak for themselves. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's right, the first day. Now you can focus on your business and let ZipRecruiter do the work finding the best people for you. See for yourself. Experience the ease, efficiency, and power of ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter.com/free.
Prescriptions require an online consultation with a healthcare provider who will determine if appropriate. Restrictions apply. See website for details and important safety information. Subscription required. Price varies based on product and subscription plan.
Hey guys, did you know there's a generic form of Viagra that works just the same but is 95% cheaper? And you can get it online at hims.com/joy. Through Hims, you'll get a free medical consultation to determine the ED medication that's best for you. Discreet shipping if prescribed, a 100% online process, and a range of treatment options, including trusted generic alternatives to the name brands, at up to 95% off. ED is personal, and at Hims, so is treating it. Just go to hims.com/joy and get connected to a licensed medical provider online for free. With zero copay, no expensive appointments, and no awkward face-to-face conversations. To start your free online visit, you need to go to this exclusive address, hims.com/joy. That's hims.com/joy for your free online visit, hims.com/joy.
As an educator, Mr. Nelson's teachings are still being quoted in schools.
Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world.
Mr. Nelson taught hope.
Everyone can rise above their circumstances if they are dedicated and passionate.
And giving our best efforts.
It's always impossible until it's done.
Mr. Nelson Mandela's teachings not only united a nation, they inspire us today. Inspiration. Pass it on from PassItOn.com.
Hey everyone, it's Ted from Consumer Cellular, the guy in the orange sweater, and this is your wake-up call. If you're paying too much for wireless service, you don't have to keep having that nightmare. Consumer Cellular has the same fast, reliable coverage as the leading carriers for up to half the cost. So why keep spending more than you have to? Seriously, wake up and call 1-888-FREEDOM or visit ConsumerCellular.com.
Savings based on cost of Consumer Cellular single line 1, 5, and 10 gig data plans with unlimited talk and text compared to lowest cost single line postpaid unlimited talk, text, and data plans offered by T-Mobile and Verizon January 2024.
For the ones who work hard to ensure their crew can always go the extra mile, and the ones who get in early so everyone can go home on time, there's Grainger, offering professional-grade supplies backed by product experts so you can quickly and easily find what you need. Plus, you can count on access to a committed team ready to go the extra mile for you. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Hey everyone, this is Brett Boone. Would you know it? I've got a podcast going strong in our fourth year. Tune in as I sit down with my friends, some of the biggest names in sports, media, entertainment, for a lot of fun and in-depth conversations. As you know, baseball's been my life. It's been in the family for a long time, but it's a lot more than that here. It's sort of like taking a ride in a golf cart around a beautiful track. Join me every week for multiple episodes on the Brett Boone Podcast, available on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Coming up in about 8 minutes, we'll get into the performance so far this season from MJ Melendez, particularly in these clutch moments, what it means for the rest of his 2024 campaign. But late on Friday afternoon, the Chiefs made a move to basically now bring back the entire defensive line from a season ago. And hey, it was part of the top defense in the NFL. Mike Dana returning to the Chiefs on a 3-year deal worth $24 million, $13 million of which are guaranteed. And what's significant about this, other than just, hey, you already brought back Derek Nnadi, you brought back Chris Jones, and now you brought back Turk Ward, and you bring back Mike Dana, is it's the first time that Brett Veach has signed a draft pick of his to a multi-year deal to stay. I think that's crazy. Now they're about to.
God,
think about it.
Yeah,
that's we you and I briefly like actually
we talked about this the other day. Didn't really extend guys.
Yeah, and so you know, look, it's going to end up being multiple guys here pretty soon because whether it's Creed Humphrey or Nick Bolton or Trey Smith, I mean, one of those three at least, if not two of the three, are going to get extensions as well. So pretty soon, this stat won't mean anything because it'll just be, okay, you draft well, you're obviously going to retain players. But that's crazy. I mean, in the middle of a dynasty run, with the success they've had, they've obviously had some great picks here the last 2+ years.
He's let most of those guys
go. Mike Dana is the first guy that they said, you know what? Money's right. Let's make this happen. The guy had 6.5 sacks last year.
And by the way, they still let him hit free agency. They're like, you know what? That's fine. Go find your worth. Go see what's out there on the market. And we're always here if you want to have a conversation. But please, go find your worth and do that thing. Look, this is, I don't remember when we started talking about this. A month ago, I told you I wanted them to sign Mike Dana.
Yeah.
And now that I've seen the price, and again, they haven't broken down the entire number, but three for $24 million? Perfect. $8 million a year? You and I both know that that third year is going to be funny money.
That's why 13 so, mil is guaranteed.
Yeah, so. Dude, this is a fantastic signing for them. Mike Dana is one of those players. And look, he might be more valuable to the Chiefs than he is to the rest of football. And I think based on this number, the rest of football viewed it that way. But he has literally gotten better every single year he's been a Chief. From the time he was a rookie to his last year, this previous year was his best year as a Chief. The one before that was his previous best year as a Chief. The one before that was his previous best year as a Chief. Why wouldn't I want a guy who's gotten better four consecutive years, gotten more sacks in four consecutive years, and works well with Chris Jones, with George Karloftis, which whatever defensive end maybe they draft, maybe with Felix and Udike Uzama, all of those things. Now, I think you could make an argument. This does not speak highly of Felix because Dana played outside a huge chunk of the season last year. Karloftis is going to play the other outside. Chris Jones is going to play the middle. Where's Felix playing?
Yeah, so I don't think it's always about Felix. I know you like to make it about Felix a lot, but I think there's some
part
of it.
How is it not about him? I mean, they're defensive linemen together.
Charles Amenihue's not playing until November or December. That's how I took it. There's no doubt in all seriousness that, yes, some of it has to do with a backup plan in case Felix doesn't end up playing as much and isn't the guy that they think maybe he can still be. I took it as, all right, makes sense. Even if you're going to tell me Felix is playing on the edge and Karloftis is on the other edge, you need multiple pieces in the interior to supplement Chris Jones. And this past year, the guy that did that after the 6-game suspension was Charles Amenihue. And we know he's coming off an ACL.
And he's only got 1 year left on his deal.
It's 1 year left, number one. And then is he the same player? But also, it could be November. We keep saying that. It might be October. I don't know. But
I hope it is.
It's not going to be week one. We kind of know that. So you need somebody else in there. And I want, this takes some pressure off maybe of the urgency to make sure you spend one of your top two picks on that position as well. Maybe it allows you some more flexibility. I know we'll talk more about that as the weeks go on closer to the draft. But that's what I liked about it. So yeah, I think some of it has to do with Felix, but a lot of it to me was, well, you already are down Charles Amenihue for maybe half the season.
Yeah. I'm not saying that's not part of the factor. It's the 3 years that makes me wonder it's about Felix. Because George Karloftis seems like he's here for the long haul just based on production alone. Chris Jones is here for the long haul. We know that. He just got a contract. And now Dana's got a 3-year deal. Now, look, two, more realistically. But, I mean, two, each up till only the final year of Felix. It's not all about that. Look, I like the signing.
He's got to have other pieces. We talk about depth.
You need more than one person on the defensive line. I'm not arguing any of that. I thought that they might just go draft guy, though. Because when you talk about, you just took a guy in the first round. You paid Chris Jones a mountain of money. And you have George Karloftis, your really good first-round pick from a year ago. I figured they'd just go young for the four spot. Or even cheaper veteran. Look, Dana's not costing that much. But I thought that they might even have to go further down the depth than that. Because Dana got more money. He got less per year, but more money total than what they gave Amenihue a year ago. Look, I thought their defensive line was a huge reason why the corners were so successful, because they were, and vice versa. I thought they worked perfectly as a unit. So, again, I'm fine with Dana coming back, because right now on paper, their defense doesn't look like it got all that worse.
Yeah.
Without Snead, but not way.
And Amenihue got you 7 sacks last year, and that was after missing 6 games. There's a very good chance he misses 6-plus at least this year as well. And so, is he able to come back and give you that same type of production? So, yeah, I mean, there's probably some truth to all three of these theories. I tend to think that even if you want to say it's about Felix, I would just argue that next year, like 2025, even at that point in time, you still need some, Amenihue's not under contract, so you still need somebody else alongside Chris Jones, going forward as well, no matter what. And to me, this just ensures that you've got for at least 2 more years a guy that's going to get you 6-plus sacks pretty consistently now.
Without Amenihue, you're like, well, then you were just starting Felix. I mean, the truth is, if you don't make this signing, then week one of next year, because Amenihue is hurt, your starting line is Felix on one side, Karloftis on the other, Chris Jones in the middle, and Noddy is the opposite nose tackle or whatever.
And he's the run guy.
That doesn't sound deep enough, but that's partially because of my, the questions I think should rightfully surround Felix until we see him in a regular role. I think people take it as I'm down on him because I'm not optimistic it's gonna happen, but I also don't rule it out. I don't think Felix was just washing away. I don't think his career is just done.
Camp.
I didn't like the pick at the beginning, and then there was nothing And then there was nothing to make me feel better about it at any stage. Like, yeah. So I understand that part of it. But yeah, Dana, just in its own standalone right, is a near perfect signing for the Chiefs, especially considering money. He costs very little with almost no risk. He already works in your scheme. He gets sacks. Not all the time, but he gets sacks. And he's mostly healthy. He didn't stay on the field for 17 games a year. He's on there for 13 or 14 or 15, which seems good enough. I still like the signing.
Yes, and the...
So is MBS still in the roster?
No. Reports are he might actually be signing with the Chargers. He's the Chargers are interested in MVS's services. Remember, they don't have Mike Williams or Keenan Allen anymore. Yeah. The problem with them, though, honestly, is that MVS is really good in the postseason, and the Chargers in the postseason usually don't mix. So that's the only downside, I think, with that potential signing.
What good does it do? Yeah, I was about to say, what good does it do to get a good playoff performer if you're never in them?
That's right. So we'll see if he ends up signing there.
Enjoy yourself, I guess. You know?
So, yeah.
Enjoy your time, MVS. It won't be as much fun. But at least, you know.
He came up big in the postseason. I told you, the way we view him should be viewed much differently because of the postseason success.
They won two Super Bowls. Yeah. I don't care how much they paid MVS while he was here. They won two Super Bowls while he was here.
Would it matter in the postseason? Big-time catches?
He could have made $100 million a year the 2 years he was here just on the Super Bowl. Yep. I don't care.
I know it's probably financially related, but it would be funny. It would be interesting to see MVS get signed ahead of Tyler Boyd, OBJ, some of these other guys.
I think he might before OBJ. OBJ might have to wait a bit. I think Tyler Boyd might happen sooner than we think, but OBJ, there's a chance that takes a lot longer.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a veteran, too, because you run into when did Beckham sign last year? It was a little later, wasn't it?
I think
in the process? I feel like we talked about his name forever.
Yeah, I think so.
And it just dragged on. Now, I know he was coming off the ACL injury, and so a lot of question about his availability and everything. So we'll talk some more Chiefs football a little bit later on, but I want to get back to the Royals, who are off to a great start this season. They're off today, though, and then they open up that series, as we said, against the Astros. But MJ Melendez, I mean, there's been always optimism around what he potentially could be. I mean, we've talked to J.J. Piccolo about the power potential they still see in him. And by the way, J.J. Piccolo will join us tomorrow on the show. We've talked to Vern about what potential you could have. Right now, though, he's Mr. Clutch.
He's got a game-winning hit, or essentially but the go-ahead hit in three consecutive games.
The Royals put out this stat yesterday. Melendez is the first player in Royals history to drive in the game-winning run, seventh inning or later, in three straight games. So when it matters most, those clutch moments, he's been able to step up, and he's also shown some pop. Hit another home run yesterday that ended up giving the Royals the lead. Obviously, Hunter Renfroe had a home run earlier in the game, too, which was nice to see considering his start. But Melendez, I mean, all of a sudden, if he's going to be clutch, but if he's just going to be hitting this way at all at the plate, looks confident. You know, he changed the grip second half of last season on the bat. All of that put together, he just looks like a completely different hitter. And that is huge for a team. Not only that, hey, you're counting on, you know what you're going to get from Bobby and you know what you're going to get from Salvi, but you start adding in a player like Melendez, who last year had a rough first half. All of a sudden you get that's how you flip the season from 56 wins, not just to getting to 70, but you flip it to suddenly being right there in the thick of things, maybe in an AL Central race. And it matters so much right now, Cody, because Vinny's off to a rough start. So at some point, if you can get him going, this is why you're able to still have the offensive success, because you've got a guy that maybe you weren't counting on as much that is performing at a really high level.
Yeah, four of the five first hitters are all hitting great. Garcia's hitting great. Bobby Wood Jr. is hitting great. MJ Melendez is hitting great. And Salvi's hitting really well to start the season as well. So four of the first five are really going well, which makes you feel better. I'm calling it now. MJ Melendez breakout season is officially upon us. Not like, oh, it could be. I think it's here. We had spent some time in the baseball offseason talking about this, and the guy I had pointed to a couple of times was Mike Moustakas. It is not weird for a baseball player at age 25 to start figuring out what it's like to be a big leaguer, and that's what MJ Melendez is doing. He has two full seasons. This is the first season where he knew he was playing outfield, not being screwed around, trying to figure out if he's an outfielder or a catcher or both or neither. And instead, he had an entire offseason after fixing his thing. And some of it, I honestly think, is pure confidence. Everyone could see from the second MJ Melendez was in the minors, he had this level of talent. He led the minor leagues in home runs one time. So, like, he obviously always had this level of talent. He would get on base. He'd hit homers. He had power. And you would always like shrink it a little bit because you're like, oh, is it catcher? Is it going to work there? Can he catch full time? He's an outfielder with tremendous power. I think the breakout season's here. I don't know. I mean, I don't think he's going to hit 330 with a 390 or whatever on base percentage all year. But I think we're in the midst of which watching the MJ Melendez breakout season. The only question remaining is because of the confidence thing, which he's admitted.
Yeah, after the game yesterday, he talked about that.
Yeah, if, let's say, because at some point it's going to happen. Let's say May 15th through 30th, MJ goes through his slump. Because slumps will happen for everybody. For right now, for Vinny, it's at the beginning of the season. For MJ, it'll be later in the season or whatever. When he goes through that two-week stretch of struggle, can he snap back out of it and just go on about his merry way for the times he's hot? That's the only remaining question I have about the current level of hot he is.
I think that's fair. Yeah, I think that's very fair considering where he had been, you know, for the first, 3 months of last season and then how he ended the year. And there's still probably for a lot of people that, all right, so this is 2 weeks of it and wanting to see if he can have a full month of April where he's performing at anywhere near this level, not this particular level, because as you said, that's just not sustainable and not going to be fair to hold anybody to some of the numbers that some of these guys are having right out of the gate when we talked about even the pitching staff as well. But it's fun, man. Like, you know, even just this 2 week stretch, what you're seeing from, you know, big key hits that you just didn't get last year in these spots. And, you know, you mentioned confidence from one particular player, what that does for everybody else in the lineup and in the rotation. When you're getting this kind of starting pitching and the belief that signals through the rest of the roster, I think that's why you're also seeing some of these guys elevate their performance, because how can you not when you start to see that, you know, when you truly right now, it's not even like, oh, you're trying to talk yourself into it. When you go out there every night right now, you're starting pitching, you know, you've got a great chance to win. And it's a real thing. You don't have to like convince, you know, like talk, do mental gymnastics to get there. Like right now, you know that every single one of your starting pitchers is going to give you a hell of a chance to win. And that is a huge thing. I think it's a powerful thing to have in the back of your mind if you're a hitter right now, just knowing that you don't have to get six runs to win these games necessarily.
Right now, it's only three or four. They're not like one of the best run scoring teams in the league in the early going.
Timely hits, though. Big time hit. The go ahead 2-run home run yesterday by Melendez. Obviously Renfro had one earlier in the game that was key, and it was nice to see him after the rough start get his bat. Hopefully maybe that's the start of getting him going a little bit.
Yeah, and look, Renfro, he's done, but you know, that's the other thing, that baseball's so weird like that. He's also had like 17 outfield assists already. Mm-hmm. It seems like
teams keep testing him. It's kind of fun. Go
his
ahead.
Nickname before was Hunter Renfro. Is that like not new information? It's been his nickname for years.
Yeah, he's been leading the league in outfield assists, I think, or top five, something like that recently, and yet, go ahead and keep testing them.
Mostly because of the bottom of the order. I was only ever hoping for the fact that the Royals could be like a mid-level offense. And to this point, they are. They're 13th or whatever in runs scored. Okay, great. Like you said, the pitching is the reason why their record is what it is. And if the bullpen had held up, their record would be even better. Nah, I just think MJ's in the throes of breakout season. It just, you could normally feel it coming. And normally the first thing to start on is, how talented are they as a player? How talented were they coming up? It's a lot harder to predict the breakout season when they weren't like one of the best players in there. He was a baseball top 100 prospect the entire time he was in the minor leagues. I told you, led the baseball in home runs. He was always a really talented player. Just took him a couple years to figure it out in the big leagues. Oh.
Man, we got an eclipse today. Earthquake over the weekend. Now sirens.
Should we be playing this when, you know, the world might end?
That's right. That's what some people are trying to say.
Warning for maybe that, but also a new mock draft. A 3-rounder, guys, from from our Nick Bumgarner.
Don't know who that is. Is that related to Madison Bumgarner?
That's his cousin, actually.
Nick Bumgarner at the Athletic.
They're in-laws.
Yeah, by the way, I don't know if you know this. Bumgarner's not a name we like to mention in this city. Not really a name we like to
mention.
Maybe
I should have just said it once.
I respect the hell out of him, but you know.
Okay, I'm just going to call him Nick from now on.
Yes, please.
Nick. Nick's mock draft from the Athletic. The Chiefs are going wide receiver in this one, but it's a name that it's come up, but not as often as some of the others. Ladd McConkey, they have at 32, going to the Kansas City Chiefs.
Ladd McConkey.
At 64, defensive tackle Mike Hall from Ohio State.
I don't know who that is.
Solid player, not, I guess, anything, you know, he's not.
Okay.
Or a gangbuster. 95, Tylan Grable, offensive tackle from UCF. So they go to the trenches, but they do get the wide receiver in the first round, yes.
So offensive tackle in the third, that just means Wanye competition, not Wanye start. You just let two people try to figure it out. I'll be honest. I'm gonna like Ladd McConkey.
Is that? Everybody always picks one of two guys. Is he on your list?
I'll be honest. So you know, normally by the time the draft hits, I give you the one or two wide receivers I really hope they take. I'm gonna tell you right now. By the time we hit the draft, Ladd McConkey's one of them. At 32, where they're sitting, the guy I want. You remember his pickings a couple of years ago. It varies a little bit. Last year it was JSN who unfortunately went in the teens. But
yeah, I wanted Olave a couple of years ago.
You did. Which, unfortunately, he was way too high.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I can't tell you Rome Odunze because he's going to go way too high.
No. Look, we can all, like, I'd like Marvin Harrison Jr. You know, like, you and I try to toss out some realistic names. I remember you were in love with Olave, but you knew that it was also not going to happen.
Yeah.
Out of the wide receivers who will be available at that time, I like McConkey better than I want, more than I want Xavier Worthy or the other guys. I think it works. I think, other than that, my other one might be Keon Coleman. Like, if I'm leaning into two right now, I think those are my guys. I think Keon Coleman ends up being the sneaky guy because he runs one slow 40, and they forget that he's fast on a football field. He's one of the fastest people on the football field, but people will look at him in shorts and change their mind.
Yeah, the only thing with McConkey is just the injury stuff, right? Like, you get a little worried. That's the only thing with him is, you know, do you want to draft a guy that we're going to be talking about can't stay healthy? That's part of the evaluation process. That would be my only thing that would...
Elijah Morris is comp from NFL Network, or from NFL.com. Okay, but I think he is the perfect... number three wide receiver could be a number two, but he is the perfect number three wide receiver, I think, for an offense. A good quarterback.
To get McConkey, though, like, do you have to go first round? I guess what I'm saying is, like, is he a guy that might just be there on Friday night and you can get him in the second round?
Maybe.
You'd have to move up to get him on Friday, I think. Okay. His range
or move back on Thursday.
His range is from 32 to, like, 40, 45-ish. Like, it's been in that.
So, yeah, like Cody was saying, you trade out.
A lot of people have him going to the Panthers at 30. Like, a lot of other mock drafts have had the Chiefs get Xavier Worthy or Keon Coleman or whoever, and then Ladd McConkey is literally the next guy a couple of times to the Panthers. So he's right there in that range.
Okay. I don't mind Ladd McConkey. And then, like, you get your tackle. Defensive lineman. They're kind of covering the gambit.
Where's that
kid from Texas going to go now? Isn't he, like, he was supposed to be like a...
Xavier Worthy?
No.
The tackle that got in
trouble. Yeah, the one who got in trouble. Because he was supposed to be a second-round pick, and now they're saying he's going to...
They were mocking him in the first round, but now it's... Yeah, but I don't know.
Reportedly, he talked to teams about how he used to party too much in college and then said it's behind him.
Devondre Sweat got a DWI.
So.
Arrested charged with DWI in Austin.
Yeah, the Bengals have been mocked with him a couple of times, so I'm hoping that they don't take him.
Someone says, give me A.D. Mitchell in that range. 9.99 Raz. That's the relative athletic score for those who aren't paying attention to that.
I still think, though, the Bills trading Diggs makes it a little more challenging unless you're going to trade up to...
Agreed.
Because, like, the Bills are taking a wide receiver. The question is, the Bills are picking, what, 28? Are they going to trade up from 28 to get to, you know, 18 to go get a wide receiver? We know that in the past the Chiefs have traded in front of the Bills, but I think it's very difficult for the Chiefs to trade up, considering not only where they're at, but just willingness from other teams to kind of work with them. And so the fact that we know, like, it's almost a certainty the Bills are taking a wide receiver now, the same names that we're all talking about and circulating, this same names they're running through in Buffalo.
Yeah,
the same
ironically, names, you mentioned that in this mock. They have A.D. Mitchell going to the Bills.
Okay.
At 20. It is. So they have the Chiefs taking Ladd, and then if you go further down, that's when you see Keon Coleman's name come up. That's when you see some of the other wide receivers come up. So they think the Chiefs could take Ladd ahead of Troy Franklin, ahead of Keon Coleman.
You think Aaron Ladd wants them to take Ladd McConkey? You think Aaron
just because their
wants
names
that?
Are the
you
same?
Think that's what it is. I already see the text line talking about it. We only the Ladd Army thing that people on the text line call them now.
Laddies.
That's what we said on this show.
Laddies.
Yeah. That's way worse.
Who is the tackle you said for the second round on this mock? Who the hell is this?
The tackle.
The defensive tackle, right?
Yes. The D tackle was Mike Hall Jr. He's been mocked second round consistently the entire time.
All right. Does Bink like him? Do we know? We'll have to get Bink's thoughts on this guy.
I think if
he's 20. I like that.
Another
developmental guy, probably.
Forget the names.
Yeah, second rounder. More forgiving of it.
If the Chiefs go wide receiver, D tackle, offensive tackle, obviously you want them to play well. But if they go wide receiver, D tackle, O tackle, are you?
Yes.
Is that what you? Is that an ideal position? By
borderline round? Perfect. That those are the first three positions taken in whatever order you decide for me.
Okay.
But that's borderline. I don't know that I would change anything. If I got to choose the positions they took and they took three different ones, 1, 2, 3, I would want those three.
I would agree with that. I think that once you get past the first two rounds, I do think at some point they're going to take a corner. I disagree with all the mocks that have them taking a corner in the first round. I just would be surprised. But I think if you told me in the third round they took a corner, I don't think that's completely out of question. Trying to move forward, although that's still even the third round would be earlier than they've taken some of the other guys. I mean, we know with the exception of trading up for Trent McDuffie, they typically have waited to even more of the middle round than I would like a post round three, four, five, six round wins when they've been actually taking some corners in the past. So we shall see. But that's the latest mock draft as we get closer and closer to the NFL draft. And don't forget, coming up later on this month, we'll be at the Landing in Liberty for our 6:10 NFL draft party. That's Thursday, April 25th, night one of the NFL draft, is brought to you by Hy-Vee, the proud official grocery sponsor of the Kansas City Chiefs, and the entire 6:10 crew is going to be hanging out up there. Character Concerns going to be doing their show. We also have an opportunity for you to win $610 plus some Chiefs merchandise. You just got to go to 610sports.com. There's a form on there. You think you know how this draft is going to go? You're going to do your own mock drafts. You predicted how it's going to go. If you're the best at it, you're going to win some money. It's that simple. You get points based off of picking the right guy and the right team. So you just got to grab that form off our website and make sure you bring it in on Thursday, April 25th at the Landing in Liberty. Coming up next, though, we'll get back into college basketball a little bit. Not only the title game tonight that's not going to start till like 8:30, but what happened yesterday in the women's Final Four in the national title game and what it actually means about the sport going forward.
Hey, it's Brady Singer. You're listening to Cody and Gold, weekdays starting at 10 on 610 Sports Radio and the Odyssey app.
Brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
Hey, it's Gold again, talking about DuraVision and a decision that I made almost 3 years ago. It was a decision that I was almost not willing to make. It was pretty simple. Do I pick up the phone and call DuraVision for a free consultation? I was worried, am I going to be told yet again that you're not a candidate for LASIK, your eyes aren't going to work for this? Because that was what I was told many, many, many years ago. But technology changes, your eyes change, and you simply got to call the best in Kansas City when it comes to your vision needs. That's what I did. DuraVision can be reached at 913-491-3330. And they told me, after taking all these images of my eye, that they could put a plan in place. And they showed me what that plan was. And a few days later, I underwent LASIK, and now I don't need contacts. I don't need glasses. It truly has been the best decision I have made. And you just have to find out if you're a candidate as well by giving them a call for that consultation at 913-491-3330. Or go online to DuraVision.com and tell them Gold from 610 sent you.
Congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs. Another year, another Super Bowl. Did you know that the Chiefs won the Super Bowl in their first year of their partnership with Window World? And here we are, 5 years in. The Chiefs are a dynasty, and they're still going strong with Window World as the official window of the Kansas City Chiefs. Window World windows are one of two windows with a good housekeeping seal of approval, ranked number one in number of windows sold in the country by Qualified Remodeler magazine. In just over 20 years of business, they have improved the look and thermal efficiency of over 54,000 customers right here in Kansas City. So be sure to call this number, 816-799-0820. Learn more about the double-strength glass that gives a strength that's not commonly used in replacement windows. Learn more about their products that are not only durable, but offer security, beauty, and energy efficiency. Give my friends at Window World a call. That's 816-799-0820, 816-799-0820 to learn more, or also go on the website, windowworld.com.
Hi, it's Trey Smith, and in order for our team to get a victory, we need honesty, teamwork, work ethic, humility, and the golden rule. That's why my truck is from the dealer that embodies all those values, Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. And Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram also supports Giving Hope, whose sole purpose is to feed and clothe the needy in Wyandotte County and beyond. Giving back in the highest integrity, that's how Jeff and his team do business. For your next vehicle, visit or go to VictoryChryslerDodgeJeepRam.com.
The Landing in Liberty, the largest sports bar north of the river, and the home of over 65 HD TVs with every sports package. Hey, our motto is any game, anytime. 10,000 square feet under one roof to provide adequate social distancing. Our non-smoking patio is not covered, but in the winter, it's home of the only dine-in heated igloos in the Northland. Each igloo has its own TV and sound system and seats up to 8 people. The Landing has a great menu featuring the best dry rub wings in Kansas City and the home of the Ben Maller Chicken Fingers. Most of our menu items, dressing, and wing sauces are house-made. daily food specials, happy hour every day from 3 till 7 p.m. Live music on our smoking patio Thursday through Sunday nights. Make your next destination the Landing in Liberty. Food, fun, music, and sports. The Landing in Liberty, 1189 West Kansas Street in Liberty. Check us out online at thelandingeateryandpub.com. We'll see you at the Landing.
Tonight is the bittersweet end of the tournament. But FanDuel lets you make it a little bit sweeter. Whether you're betting on the favorite or you like the underdog tonight, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook app. Because right now, new customers can get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. Tonight is going to be an exceptional game, so you can bet on who you think is going to have the most points in the game, bet on your over-unders, your player props, whatever you're feeling. That's $200 to use on your favorite bets, anything that catches your eye. All you need to do is use FanDuel.com. Use my promo code FanDuel.com/CDOT and bet on some college basketball tonight as we see who cuts down the nets. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issue is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expires 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under agreement. Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Get help with your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700 or visit KSGamblingHelp.com.
Drowning in IRS debt? If you can't afford to pay your IRS debt due to economic hardship, you can now be free of IRS collection efforts by taking advantage of a special IRS tax hardship program. This program allows Americans who owe the IRS to resolve their delinquent tax debt once and for all. In some cases, maybe even reducing what you owe significantly. An open phone line has been established by Community Tax for consumers to call and see if they qualify. Simply dial 800-485-7220. If you owe back taxes to the IRS and cannot afford to pay them back or have years of unfiled tax returns, help is standing by. Just call the Community Tax Helpline today at 800-485-7220 for the help that you need. Don't take on the IRS alone. They can attack your wages, savings, pension, home, and even your Social Security check. Call 800-485-7220 to see if you qualify. That's 800-485-7220.
Are you someone who tries to drive while distracted by your phone? Someone who props it on the steering wheel or peeks down at it for a glance? Or just scrolls and scrolls? If so, you could be the next person to get into a fender bender, get a ticket, veer off the road, or even cause a crash that kills you or someone else. Enough already. Put the phone away or pay. Paid for by NHTSA.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. Wounded Warrior Project was created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war, whether those scars are physical or mental. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind. Ever. Learn more about what we do at woundedwarriorproject.org.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios. Come hang out with everyone from 610 Sports Radio on Thursday, April 25th at the Landing in Liberty as the Character Concerns podcast crew broadcasts live during the first round of the NFL Draft. 610 Sports Radio, KCSP Kansas City, WDAF HD2 Liberty, always live on the free Odyssey app.
Hour here on Cody and Gold. Less than 2 hours away from the start of the eclipse.
You're really excited.
I am. I don't have our glasses yet, man. Got to get the glasses.
The hell? I mean, you can't go shop for them now. What's your game plan?
Well, here? I think you can. The gas station by my place had them still yesterday.
No, I mean, you physically can't go shopping for them. We are at work.
Well, the email we got on Friday said that others in our building are doing a eclipse party. In the 1 o'clock hour, and they're supposed to have cosmic brownies and extra glasses. And so I figured, you know, around 12 o'clock.
That's a lame ass. I'm going to say it. That's a lame ass eclipse party.
That's it. That was the email. I can read you the exact email, but I just need to go down and grab the couple glasses. Do you want one or do you know?
I mean, sure, I guess.
You know, if we're going to be looking out the window later on today, you might want them.
Yeah, where's the sun going to be at?
Well, that's what I'm wondering. I can't see the sun.
Shouldn't we leave the show early and just like you know,
you want to
go
see
it.
Oh, so you want to end the show early at like 1:48 so we can walk outside. So by 1:54, we're good.
Listen to this sentence and tell me if it sounds cool. Oh, man. Can't wait to turn into the radio to hear the play-by-play of the eclipse via audio. No, man, people want to see it. They want to see the eclipse. No one wants our account of the eclipse from inside a building.
See,
that's like a Sirius XM podcast of like a Christmas tree lighting. Bitch, I need to see the tree. This doesn't do me any good.
Yes, but
I'm not saying do anything. I'm saying, you're right. I'm saying play commercials and go see it.
So you just went in the
I'm
show
saying
early.
We do something.
Because yeah. I will tell you this.
But what are we helping the people with?
Well, two things. One, I think versus signing off, being on the air during it to me is cool. The other part is this might stun you. I know this might stun you, Cody. But at 1:54, stoplights and traffic doesn't just stop. People are still driving in their car and listening to the radio at 1:54. So they might be driving. And then suddenly for that, I don't know, 20-second time span, it's going to get kind of dark-ish. And then it's light again. And then it's done. It's over.
I think your first argument's your stronger one, which is, I just want to be on the air when eclipse is happening. Are you just ruining someone's baseball card over there?
Oh, that's what it's trash just laying around over here. The morning show brought in a box of baseball cards, and there was a couple that were left out. And sorry.
Who is it?
This one was Hal McCray. No, they're like
Hal McCray. You just ruined a Hal McCray card?
These are the cards that like everybody had in the 90s or 80s, you know, where they printed 100,000 of them. And so unfortunately, they're worth a penny, if that. You know, you might as well just put them in your tire spokes, you know. That's what these kind of cards are.
A John Mattingly cardboard.
I don't know. You tell me. You got kids. I don't know.
So next week, we are pre-planning the training of off training wheels.
Ah, okay.
I don't know. We'll get to that stage before I figure out the cards and the spoke thing. I don't know.
The amount of...
A lot of pressure to teach a kid literally everything.
Yeah.
The amount of cardboard Don Mattingly baseball cards I had was ridiculous. It's like, really, another one? I don't need it.
Don Mattingly.
A lot of people talking about certain activities they want to do right at 1:54 today. We joked about before the show. Is that something people are going
to
do?
Seems like I assume there'll be someone who wants to have sex during the eclipse. I'm not really sure what that does for it.
1:54 in the afternoon on
that
a Monday.
That really gets people going, I guess.
Good for you.
You have to have sex outside if you're going to have sex during the eclipse. Otherwise, what's the point? You can't just like, I had sex inside. Like that's a normal
circumstance. So you, on one of the numerous decks, you want to have sex out on the deck.
I don't think my decks offer enough privacy for that.
Well, that's what you said outside. Otherwise, you're going to get yourself into trouble.
Well, I mean, maybe not. Spoiler. I've had sex outside in my life.
Oh, we've talked about this on the show. And we finally got you to tell the story. Like,
well, it's more than once.
At a public park. Nonetheless,
one was also in an apartment complex pool, but we don't have to get into those.
Not in the pool. complex? In the apartment? I mean, that's bad for you, too, I feel like.
I was going to say.
For everybody involved. Anyway, we'll talk more eclipse later on today during the show. Were you locked in, though, yesterday afternoon? Thinking of afternoon stuff, college basketball, women's hoops yesterday. I don't know why the game was on at 2 in the afternoon, I'll be honest.
Kind of a disgrace.
It should have been
that's
at 7.
Kind of offensive.
I'm, of course, talking about Iowa and South Carolina, and we haven't got the numbers yet, but I'm guessing it'll break records again, like all these games involving Caitlin Clark have. And it ended up being, you know, I know that the final score wasn't close, but there were plenty of competitive moments throughout. Iowa got off to the great start. Caitlin Clark scored 13 points in a row and all of that. And so South Carolina has lost like one game in the last two seasons. So if it wasn't for losing to Iowa last year, they would be winning. They'd be on a
undefeated for 3 years with 3 national championships.
Yeah. And they essentially would have won 70 something games in a row, which is nuts. So that in its own right is crazy. I think the real question for me is we're seeing more intrigued than ever for the women's game. Caitlin Clark's going to be the top pick in the WNBA draft. And fast forward a year from now, like are people going to be as interested in the college game as they were this go around? And is there any transfer effect over to the WNBA? Because I think that's a big jump to say that, okay, all these names that people started to know in the college game, now people are going to start watching the WNBA. I think we're still a little ways off from that effect, But the college game, I do think the college game is going to stay where we're at. I'm not going to break ratings records every year. That was definitely Caitlin Clark. Sure. But that's what you need if you're the women's game. You need the people that watched on a Sunday afternoon the national championship game in the middle of a Sunday afternoon. They chose to watch, and a lot of them did because of Caitlin Clark. Are those same people going to tune back in next March when it's not Caitlin Clark? And I understand there's other names, but it's not the same effect. Nobody's brought the people to the game the way she did.
That's what makes it a little bit different. Like when you're saying, hey, we'll have a WNBA effect. Because we've seen a lot of different great women's college basketball players, right? Like Diana Taurasi. She didn't drive viewership to the WNBA. Although I will admit, the WNBA viewership has gone up every year, just like any other growing sport. But Caitlin Clark was at a whole nother supernova level. Because the fact that she's
look at
the one
you
we're talking
in supernova. I see what you're doing.
I wasn't on purpose, I guess,
see. Okay.
She's at a completely different level.
Stratosphere.
Than anyone else has ever done to that sport. Because she's the bigger story. Like people were giving, I don't remember what it was. Like the Washington Post or the Athletic a hard time could be like, South Carolina finishes undefeated season and they used a photo of Caitlin Clark. It's like, that's not a knock on Dawn Staley has done an incredible job. She lost her starting five and then went undefeated and won a national championship. The job she has done, and she's a great character in her own right for the sport, but Caitlin Clark just brought a different audience to it. It brought everyone in. So, yeah, I think there's a little carryover, but you have to continue the momentum of, like, high-level rivalry play. I still think the biggest problem the women's sport has is it's in its infancy a lot in the way that men's basketball was in the 70s and 80s, which is people like dynasties. They don't like this level of domination very often. UConn won like 7 titles in 11 years.
And won like 90 games in a row.
Yeah, now it looks like they won 4 straight national championships. And now it kind of looks like South Carolina might be going through the same run. It's like,
I think it's all about the personality.
You need a little more mix.
It's all about the personality and storylines. And for the first time over, you know, the last couple of years, you've had that.
You had
some of the back and forth between LSU and in Iowa, and that drew a lot of fans in. That, you know, people got fired up for that. How I knew that the college game has also advanced, because I don't think we're unfortunately going to see, I don't believe we're going to suddenly see the WNBA just become way more popular next year. I would love to see. I don't buy that. I think we're still a ways off from that trickle down effect. But how I know the college game is there, other than just the ratings, the fact that people on Friday night were arguing back and forth about crappy officiating. That's how I know it's now we're talking. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now we're talking. People are bitching about foul calls
late in games.
People
maybe
are arguing about, you know, Lynette Woodward's comments and scoring. There's all these types
of. Why is she? Why is sour grapes there?
She quickly backtracked, but yeah, that was bad.
Backtrack. It's too late. Your comments were so stern.
No, I mean she put out. Yeah. I mean backtrack because she put out a statement. Later.
Yeah.
But the fact that these debates are happening, that to me actually tells us where the sport is. That's what we, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like that's the kind of stuff that shows me that, okay, we have come a long way, and this is how we're, the same crappy arguments that we have at times and everybody thinks the refs suck, we were having them Friday night.
It's just a lot of whether or not they can maintain it. This is the first year in my personal life, and I think a lot of people's life, where I was more interested in the women's tournament than the men's. It's not that I didn't. I tuned in for some of the championship stuff too, right? Where Diana, like we mentioned, Taurasi and UConn, you're like, I kind of want to see if this, like, crazy thing's going to happen. But, like, again, Caitlin Clark just kind of brought a different level of audience to it, and it kind of changed it a little bit. Like, tonight I'm interested in the men's game, but I was way more interested in the Final Four for women's. The reason why I'm intrigued tonight, I watched very little of both men's semifinal games. A little.
And they were the blowouts we thought they were going
to
be.
But I watched very little of both of those games. Interested tonight because it's the two best teams all year going at it for a championship and a champ for UConn to go back-to-back. But, yeah, it was a really good year for women's basketball. Caitlin Clark did a lot for the sport. But so did Dawn Staley and all those things, and Angel Reese and everybody else who was involved in these
I'll be honest, though. Like I watched because of Caitlin Clark. I mean, yes, there were these other storylines, but why did I actually sit down on Sunday afternoon and watch
Clark?
It was because Caitlin Clark.
Did
and she
18
did,
points in the first
she delivered
quarter.
In the first quarter. Yeah, I mean, that's why I watched, you know, and so we'll see. I'm not saying it won't happen next year, but it's going to, I do think for me to be locked in on a Sunday afternoon, it's going to take something pretty special again.
Did you guys watch any of the Super Diana Taurasi?
I didn't.
It's very interesting because everybody seems to be encapsulated with what Caitlin Clark did, not Diana Taurasi. But she was straight up hating. It was It was.
But again, that to me shows the sport has arrived. The same thing where we have talked about haters and it's like, yeah, people
LeBron
hate on LeBron
and Jordan and all. Yeah,
I think it's really so she still plays and it's really
never retire.
It was really interesting to hear some of the stuff that she had to say, as well as Breonna Stewart. You know, Dan Ross is like, the WNBA is a whole different animal. She's not going to be this good in the NBA.
Great. You need that. You need
Paige Beckers or Caitlin Clark. Paige Beckers, next question. She wouldn't even talk about Caitlin Clark. It was very much a hating thing, which makes it, I think that'll be what elevates it to the WNBA level going a little bit, is Caitlin Clark is so good that it was controversial, essentially, and how good could she be in the WNBA, where maybe the first 10 games are going to be very exciting, and then from there it'll backtrack. It's not going to do the same thing. It's not going to blow it out of proportion like it has.
For the same reason that, like, WrestleMania is entertaining, right? Saturday and Sunday, people are really into it. The Rock. And like, every sport requires heroes and heels. And you need all of it to encapsulate people. If you don't have people like Deronda Taraszewski, she can't make it. She's got no chance. And then the first time they go head-to-head in a game, Caitlin Clark drops 32 in a WNBA game. Great. Then there's a little bit of juice. You need that in there. I had looked it up. I was like, you said she was still playing. I'm like, what, for real?
She's 41 or something.
41. She's playing 529 games in the WNBA. She's not retiring? She scored 19 points a game last year at 41? Oh, no, 16 points a game. Sorry, 19 is her career average. Still,
yeah,
16
I just
points
don't,
a game.
Yeah, the college game is the one that I'll be interested in to see where it continues to build off of. I'm not convinced that we're going to see the direct impact in the WNBA level. I think it's a little bit different, especially since some of the players that we got to know a little bit on the women's side of college hoops this year, I don't know if they're stepping right in and having instant success. And so if all of a sudden Caitlin Clark is just an average player her first year or two in the league, I that's not going to draw people in. So we'll see where it goes. But for the college game, yeah, they got to continue to find a way to build off of the momentum that they've had. But they definitely, you know, had a generational athlete at the time, and that always is going to boost. And
it was cool to see Dawn Staley Pay, you know, give Caitlin her flowers.
Yeah, after the game.
Yeah, that was
call
cool.
her one of the GOATs, and she is. She is one
that
of the GOATs.
That whole conversation after the game, oh, my goodness.
Losing back-to-back years in the national championship game, though. God, it's got to suck. Oh, it's got to hurt so bad.
That whole conversation afterwards. Caitlin Clark's not a GOAT because she didn't win a chip. It's
hard to be the greatest of all time, but one of the single greatest players in the sports history.
Who would you say is the greatest women's college basketball player of all time, though, is? I feel like you can put a whole lot of players in that basket and make arguments for every single one of them. You know, Andrew Reese, Caitlin Clark, Paige Beckers, Breonna Stewart, Maya Moore, Candace Parker, Dennis Taurasi.
Yeah, I mean, I just feel like you gotta win. You know, this goes back to the Gonzaga thing.
I didn't want to. I didn't mention.
You don't have to win a bunch. I'm just, you know, winning one would be good. That's all. Meanwhile, over the weekend, one of the bigger sports stories this weekend was baseball trying to dig itself a hole it doesn't need to dig. For the first time, I think in this show's history, Gold, I am going to side with Major League Baseball over the players in said league. Because the excuses I heard this weekend were just wrong. Here's the thing. It stinks that baseball is having a massive arm issue, as in Strider, gone, Bieber, gone, Cole, gone, all because we're going through these massive elbow issues for these players. But what came out over the weekend was the Players Association and the players in the league seem to be wanting to put this fully on the changes to the rules from a couple of years ago regarding baseball, the pitch clock, the minimum number of hitters faced, and everything in between. There's just no way that's causing more arm injuries. How could it? For 100 years, people pitched as fast as they were pitching, and they used to throw 7,000 innings a year with no arm injuries. There's one notable change from that time versus now, and it's velocity. It's not a bad thing. Velocity is just the name of the game, and until human evolution catches up so that ligament can support the speed in which these people can throw, velocity is the problem, something baseball wants because you need it to be successful, but will also just cause more arm injuries. It stinks, but it's not the pitch clock.
The MLBPA was so quick to blame it on pitch clock and others. Don't mess with my pitch clock, man. Don't mess with that. One of my favorite rule changes and one of the best rule changes.
It's one of the best changes they've ever made.
Over the last, 50 years, I would argue. It's one of the things he's done properly. It's sped up these games. It's why you can enjoy a game on a Saturday and not feel like it's taking up your entire day or entire night if you're going. It's easier if you're taking kids to the game. Pitch clock is a big reason. The flow of the game is so much better. So, hopefully they don't use that as a way to get that altered again, because that would be very unfortunate. But, yes, it obviously has a huge deal. A huge part of it is dealing with the velocity changes in the sport. And what you can do to fix that, I'm not sure, right? I mean, that's where the sport is headed. Before it used to be a huge deal if you were just consistently throwing 95, and now it's like expected that you better be throwing consistently 95 miles an hour.
The truth is a lot of it shows that it's at the youth level. It's like 14-year-old kids doing velocity training, because you can get like low high school kids now. I mean, they can burn it in there in low 90s. Not supposed to be able to throw low 90s. Like, in my entire life of playing baseball, I faced one kid who could throw in the low 90s in my entire life. He eventually became a major league pitcher. But it's just like, that's not common. People aren't supposed to throw at that speed. And look, are you going to change the entire level of youth sports? Because here's the whole other problem. You got to convince, they think that their best chance to get drafted and go to major league baseball is to throw in the 90s. So what are you going to do? Be like, no, it's fine. Just throw like 84. And we'll slowly get that velocity up through college or through the minors, and we'll get you up to 93 5 years later. No.
Yeah, I mean, I do think that the youth level, we can even get into whether it's velocity or just they're pitching too much at the youth level anyway, Cody. You know, the increase in pitches is not the problem at the big league level. That's a velocity thing. But I still think at the youth level, it's both velocity and some of these programs and coaches where you're not taking into account future years ahead, and you're having them exceed what their pitch count should be for their age. That I think is becoming an issue too, or has been an issue.
Well, and it's always the same stuff. It's like throwing breaking pitches before you need to. And if you're Major League Baseball, it is what it is. You don't want stars out of the sport. You don't, especially the best starting pitchers in all of the sport. You don't want that to happen. It has unfortunately been a cost of doing business thing. Casey Kirk pointing out, I saw this too. Tyler Glasnow's explanation was the gripping of the ball and the harder they grip because they don't have the sticky stuff. But this is all like the same problem. It's so if you let every pitcher have the sticky stuff, then nobody can hit. And then their sport is unfortunately not entertaining. Like they have a balance to ride, if that really is part of it. And maybe that's some small portion. I just think it's the stress you put on an arm. Like, I just think about, like, just the way bodies evolve.
Yeah, we'll ask J.J. Piccolo this tomorrow. I want to just get his perspective. He's been around baseball his entire life. He'll join us tomorrow, as we'll have him on the show throughout the season, and just get his perspective on what does he think that the increase is, and we'll talk maybe about the youth level a little bit with him. Someone pointed out, though, like, the pitch clock part, don't mess with that. That's my biggest concern.
2-hour, 27-minute Royals game yesterday.
That was my biggest concern when right away I saw the MLBPA go right to the pitch clock. I'm like, don't you dare. Don't you dare mess with this, because this has been one of the greatest things the sport has done here in recent years.
Also, fighting for that is, again, fighting for the wrong thing if you're baseball players, which is something they're really good at.
Trash of the day.
Trash of the day.
The Cook's just throwing us off. He was checking to see when it starts.
Drew's locked in. He's been looking up at the sky the entire show.
That's right.
Who are you texting, Drew? Come on, who was it?
I was texting my wife because we're having more apartment problems.
Oh, no.
More apartment problems?
The
this is down
here
trash
of
the day.
I'll table the past trash
for just
of the
a
day.
Moment. What are the problems?
The entire cabinet is leaking, or there's more leaking from that is getting into the wood in the cabinet. Also, our silverware, we pulled out the drawer in the silverware.
Oh, no. Snake?
No.
Mice?
The silverware was wet. There's leaking in the silverware.
Can you just change apartments in the same complex for the remainder of this lease? Can you just get out of this one?
So I went to them about that idea, or when somebody suggested that idea, we said no because we didn't want to have to move, and we'd have to pay. Another management person I spoke to, and they said, well, if you switch apartments or whatever, you have to redo your lease. That was what they told me.
I want to switch apartments because this one's a disaster.
So what I'm
not
going
because
to
I'm
do,
just trying to switch.
Because now we're getting into and there's more leaking. They said they fixed it. They did not. So we're getting to the point now where we're going to go in there, and I have to tell my wife to, you have to do it calmly, otherwise it's not going to work. You have to be cool, calm.
Sometimes losing it works.
I think it might be time to turn the temperature up.
It
might be time to turn the temperature up a little. I think you've been too nice. People don't know. You've told us for the last 3 weeks been dealing with the leaking problem.
Mention that you've talked to a lawyer and see how that changes.
I don't want to threaten the lawyer thing.
We're not doing that yet.
I had to do that over a catalytic converter once.
I don't know if you want to threaten the lawyer thing. That's probably not. But you can stop being too, you're being too nice, though.
I'm going to go in there, and we're going to basically say that we're getting into non-livable conditions because the leaking, and not only that, it's leaking, it's inconvenient, and also, who knows what mold is growing in there now at this point.
You should get a mold test.
I would just flat out... You guys are sick of dealing every morning and every day.
Aren't you
While you're trying to obviously go to work, you're dealing with living conditions because your apartment complex cannot fix the issue. And so if it's an issue that you guys struggle to fix, please let us move to a different opportunity. Otherwise, we would like to get out of our lease. See what they say.
Oh, I think at this point, we need to come to an agreement where we will get through the rest of this month, and we need to find a way to break this thing because evidently the apartment that we're in needs more work. Done.
Textline wants to know, have you tried just giving them $100 and hoping they fix it?
I have not done that yet.
Someone says, it's time to flip the spread, Drew.
My wife will be the one that flips it. I'll be there to console.
I think you guys walk in. We'll let you leave early today. Why don't you walk in there right at 1:54, right when it turns pitch black, and you walk in as it turns black.
It's been leaking in your apartment for 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous.
And they hadn't found the problem multiple times. It took a third person to find it, and they thought they found it, and it continues to be a problem.
Cody's right, though, on one thing. Like, at minimum, be like, hey, look, we're not looking. I mean, initially you can just say, we're not trying to break our lease, but is there another apartment we can live in this complex so we don't have to go down that path or something like that?
I had a mechanical repair. I replaced, and it wasn't stolen. I had to fix a catalytic converter that went bad in a car. I fixed it, and then 2 weeks later, it went out again, and I called this company, like, well, you should have replaced the plug, too. And I'm like, that's not going to work. It was like a mechanic. I was like, no, that won't work. And they're like, sorry, that's just, you know, like, you didn't have, like, a warranty on this kind of, like, you know. And I was like, okay, well, the next person you'll be talking to is my lawyer. And I had my brother call, being my lawyer. He's like, hey, I'm representing Cody Tapp. I need all the details of this. Guess what they did? They fixed my catalytic converter right up there, Gold. The old threat of the lawsuit moved things around nicely, it turns out.
From what I've been told,
it was literally just my brother.
If you mention mold, it really it freaks out apartment complexes because obviously that turns into
get a mold test.
Other problems.
Prove it. Like, you probably do have mold. Get one of those at-home mold tests and prove it to them. Be like, this is uninhabitable. We got to figure something out here.
You just have had so many issues at this complex. I just think you got to just lay. I mean, have you been documenting? You know, how many times you've had
emails.
I've sent emails. I've sent audio of
it's
the
time
noises.
To get out.
I have
it's
sent
time to get
video.
Out.
I have sent. I remember. We can even go back to the snake, and they said we'll get to it when we can. They didn't even say that was an emergency issue.
Look, I'll give them this, gardener snake or whatever. That's an emergency depending on the person. I would have just.
I did not tell them.
Listeners have offered to call them up and bitch for you.
Yeah. This is Drew Nixon.
I'm not.
Let him have it.
I don't want to be that person.
I just think if you've been able to document.
Someone's not wrong, by the way. It sucks to be the do you know who I am guy. Mentioning the old I'm on radio and we're about to take the name of this complex on air.
Are we? Am I allowed to do that?
A little juice.
Are we even allowed to do that? I don't think we can.
It's not illegal. People use their positions of power in which they have for their own good all the time. I don't know why this is any different.
I don't know. It just seems a bit risque to me.
Oh, look, I'm not saying it's not, you know.
That's your own
personal choice.
Yeah. Personal choice on that as well.
It's not illegal. That's
someone
sure.
said I should go after a certain group to speak to them on my behalf.
A
group that claims they have a lot of power, yeah.
Oh, they're gonna help you out?
And Casey Tennis will help us out, I guess.
Good luck with that. Coming up next, we'll get to the Chiefs Red Half Hour. One thing Legarius Sneed said over the weekend about his time in Kansas City and an early prediction for Travis Kelce.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
Made to Shine. Real stories from Shane Company customers.
The other day, my dad asked me and my sister if we had any ideas for a sweet gift for Mom for Mother's Day. And I told him we should go check out Shane Company because they've got these cool styles. You can pick out your own gemstones. To make her necklace extra special, my sister and I picked out our birthstones, amethyst and citrine. Mom's definitely gonna cry when she sees it.
Find jewelry that feels like it was designed just for you. Shane Company. Fine jewelry since 1929.
Unlike Drew, you could actually fix your leak. You own your home, you've been having that drip, you're not sure where it's coming from. Well, it might be coming from your roof, in which case you should be calling my friends over at Century Roofing. They've been in the Kansas City area for 33 years, which means they're ready to take care of this problem for you. Again, when you're a homeowner or you're in these situations, you're like, gosh, what do I do? Is this the, what's the, who can I trust? Because I told you, bad mechanic or those things, you're like, ah, who did this? 33 years locally owned and operated and been voted 2 years in a row the best roofing company in Johnson County. They've also been nominated for KC Star's Kansas City Favorites Best of KC, and voting is open now. So, I mean, look, the truth is they're the kind of company you can trust because everyone is telling you you can trust them. If you had that extreme weather come through your area, and I'm pretty sure we all did not that long ago, or for some whatever reason the eclipse does some weird weather phenomena event, you know you can get it taken care of with a reliable company who's going to make sure they're there and will be in Kansas City to stand behind their warranty for the rest of your life. Go to Century. Schedule your estimate today. From KC-based and female-owned Century Roofing, trust the pillars of strength. CenturyRoofingKC.com and tell them that Cody sent you.
Rob Brenton from The Drive here to tell you about the best window and door company in town, Renewal by Anderson. They're the full-service replacement window division of Anderson, who's been building quality windows and doors for more than 120 years. Renewal by Anderson windows and doors are proudly made right here in the U.S. of A. They custom build every window using their Fibrex composite that's twice as strong as vinyl and backed by the nation's best warranty, covering windows and doors for 20 years. Their installers are factory-trained, highly skilled craftsmen who treat your home with a level of care you do not see anywhere else in the home improvement industry. When it comes to windows and doors, go with the experts, my friends over at Renewal by Anderson. And right now, save 20% on all windows and patio doors, plus take an extra $500 off your entire project with no interest for 4 years. Just call 913-364-0200. That's 913-364-0200, 913-364-0200.
Hey, it's Kling. There are many reasons I love Hy-Vee: the great values, the selection, the service, and I love to rack up fuel savers. And you can as well. Shop Hy-Vee on Monday, earn a fuel discount equal to the high temperature on Sunday and the amount you spend. If the high is 68 degrees on Sunday, I'll save 68 cents per gallon when I spend $68 on Monday. Heat up the savings every Monday through April 29th only at Hy-Vee.
Must look up code 80007 at checkout or promo code HEATUP when shopping online. See store for details.
The best deals at the pump happen when you shop the aisles of Hy-Vee with help from the first Warm 5 weather team.
This is KCTV5 chief meteorologist Luke Doris. Watch KCTV5 Sunday night at 10 for our official high temperature.
Whatever it was on Sunday means you save on Monday with your Hy-Vee Perks card. If the high was 63 degrees, you save 63 cents a gallon when you spend at least $63.
Watch First Warn 5 weather on KCTV5 this Sunday at 10.
Win a new 2023 Harley. Rawhide Harley is giving away a new 2023 Harley Street Bob. Just come into Rawhide Harley and enter for a chance to win a new 2023 Harley. Win a new Harley today at Rawhide Harley.
No purchase necessary to enter. Valid at participating dealers. See dealer for details.
Join us at Odyssey as we all do our one thing, together millions of things, for our planet. Earth Day is April 22nd. During the spring and summer, hang your clothes outside to dry instead of using the dryer. What's your one thing?
Are you someone who tries to drive while distracted by your phone? Someone who props it on the steering wheel or peeks down at it for a glance? Or just scrolls and scrolls? If so, you could be the next person to get into a fender bender, get a ticket, veer off the road, or even cause a crash that kills you or someone else. Enough already. put the phone away, or pay. Paid for by NHTSA.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. Wounded Warrior Project was created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war, whether those scars are physical or mental. Wounded Warrior Project, we never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Learn more about what we do at woundedwarriorproject.org.
Lowe's knows pros need the right tools for every job. That's why we sell the largest in-store selection of Klein tools anywhere. Find new items like the self-leveling green laser level for just $159.98. Plus, shop the Connect pass-through socket set for $49.98, which you can only find at Lowe's. Shop Klein tools in-store and online today. Because Lowe's knows tools. Lowe's knows pros.
Look around. You can find cars like these on AutoTrader, like that car riding your tail. Or if you're tailgating right now, all those cars doubling as kitchens and living rooms are on AutoTrader too. Are you working out and listening to this ad at the same time? Well, multitasking pro, cars like the ones in the gym parking lot are for sale on AutoTrader. New cars, used cars, electric cars, maybe even flying cars. Okay, no flying cars, but as soon as they get invented, they'll be on AutoTrader. Just you wait. AutoTrader.
Robert Half research indicates 9 out of 10 hiring managers are having difficulty hiring. Robert Half is here to help. Our recruiting professionals use proprietary AI to connect businesses with highly skilled talent. At Robert Half, we know talent. Visit roberthalf.com today.
Hi, Discover. It's Jennifer Coolidge. I'm so glad I can talk to you 24/7.
How can I help?
I bought these yellow pleather pajamas, and I don't think I'm pulling them off.
Discover, 24/7 U.S.-based customer service. Limitations apply. Learn more at discover.com/creditcard.
Chiefs Kingdom, this is Mitch Holtis, and welcome in to the Chiefs Red Half Hour on Cody and Gold, every day at 11:30 on your official broadcast partner, the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
You guys can continue texting advice to Drew with his apartment situation, 913-586-7610. A lot of people willing to help, Drew. A lot of people willing to help you out.
Yeah, somebody also pointed out, they said they worked in a service department. Once threatened by a radio personality that if I didn't get a service completed in a quicker fashion, he's going to speak negatively of us on radio. So when I told my boss owner, that problem got taken care of that day.
I mean, I could be that person.
I think it's complex. I don't know if this apartment complex cares, though. You know what I mean? It sounds like based on some other texts that they also used to live there and they said, good luck.
Yeah, someone correctly guessed your apartment. I'm going to say, does Drew live in blank apartments?
The fact
because they are the worst and he has to get out. He's talking about like it's a Jordan Peele movie.
It's not like it's not like I live in La Junta, Colorado, so where there's a population of 5,000. There's a lot more people here in
Someone
Kansas City.
Still correctly guessed which apartment
Somebody
you
did.
Lived in. Said it stinks. Leave.
Well, there's been plenty of examples. I think that's clear. The clear conclusion at this point. So we'll check back in and see maybe tomorrow if you've got a better update on that or see what strategy
Yeah, we're
going
to go talk to them today. That's the
Good
plan.
Good luck with that.
Thank you.
Let's talk some Chiefs football, though, because we know L'Jarius Sneed is a member of the Tennessee Titans, and I think he had his first media availability post-trade, post-signing the new deal, and he was talking about some of the wide receivers in Kansas City, but also just his feelings of where he is at as a quarterback in the NFL. And basically you get to a point of where you are or you aren't satisfied in the league or with your standing. Listen to this, a little bit longer cut. This is from NFL radio over the weekend.
Winning the Super Bowl, got me another ring. That's what I was start off with. And once they tagged me, you know, I wasn't satisfied with the tag. You know, I wasn't, that's something I wanted, a long-term deal. And, you know, it was stressful, I could say, but I was taking every moment in because it was kind of a good stressful feeling. But I was taking it all in, and, you know, once I realized where I was headed to, you know, I was excited. You know, it's a new culture, and that's something I love is change. You know, I love growing. You know, whatever aspect it is in life, you know, I just love changing, love to grow.
You bring this experience to the Tennessee Titans, who went 6-11 last year. And so some people may say, yeah, it was about the money, but what else got you excited about joining the Tennessee Titans? What made you say, you know what, this is the place for me, maybe outside of the money?
That's someone who chose me. I had other teams in line, but, you know, this is a team who chose me. and a team who wanted me. As they say, go where you want it, and this is where I was wanted.
DeAndre Hopkins and also Calvin Ridley at practice. I can't wait for training camp because I know what those battles are going to look like. But when you start to look at this roster of the Tennessee Titans, what excites you now about your new teammates?
You know, to get out there and work with them, you know, elite wide receivers. I never had, like, two elite guys like them, you know, going up against them every day. I had great players, you know, but them two guys, you know, household names, you know, they stick out. Can't wait to get to work with those guys. I know they're going to make me better in practice, and I can't wait to pick, you know, both of their brain on how to get better, what they see, you know, what my weakness is from their eyes and not from other guys' eyes who I've been playing with for 4 years, you know. I want guys, new guys who are looking from the outside in.
So that was L'Jarius Sneed interview with NFL Radio over the weekend. I want to go back to the beginning, and then we can address the practice part. You said he wasn't satisfied with the tag. I mean, that. So there's another example of what we kind of already knew. As much as we said, sure, hey, the Chiefs clearly weren't willing to give him the extension. The reason why we probably saw the reporting very early on in the offseason that, hey, the Chiefs have given him permission to seek a trade. It wasn't just that the Chiefs wouldn't give him an extension and they didn't want him to have the $19.8 million tag. It's also the fact that they knew that L'Jarius Sneed wasn't more than we thought maybe willing to play on the tag, Cody. You know, we figured, oh, $19.8 million, that's still a huge bump. Maybe he's good with that. Sounds like just as much he wasn't maybe willing to stay in Kansas City if he knew he was only on the tag.
No, and that matters for the trade stuff. Look, they tagged him, and they probably told him, like, hey, L'Jarius, if you're going to be here, it's going to be on the tag. Like, we're giving Chris Jones the money this offseason, and we're happy to have you here. We talked about this, right? Once they'd gotten the deal done with Chris Jones, you and I explored the possibility of, like, well, what if they just kept Sneed around for one more year and went that route instead of the other? But financially, that never really made a ton of sense to me. But even less, if that player is saying he can't or he doesn't want to play under the tag. Then he said the wide receiver stuff. Look, if you listen to that entire interview, and he's on there for about 10 minutes.
He nicely said he wanted money.
That's fine.
Yeah. Yes, he said, yeah. Hey, I wanted the money. I knew, and Tennessee is where I could get the money. So go get it.
He said, they wanted me.
Yeah.
And look, that's generally probably not a bad strategy. Going somewhere where you are wanted is a pretty important thing to do when you're an athlete, especially wanted in the NFL typically means more money, not just some money, more and more and more of it. And look, I still think it's got to be almost impossible to feel good about leaving a situation in which you were back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and then all of a sudden you got to just, like, start fresh with the Titans and go about it this way. But, you know, it worked out for him. The wide receiver stuff is funny. He did try to backtrack it a little bit later. If you listen to that last little clip when he said, I've never gone up against two stars before. Here's where I always hold a difference. You and I talk about this as it relates to, like, trash talk. You're allowed to, like, you're allowed to say tune in a can if you're Jamar Chase after you beat the Chiefs. When you lose to them, it's quiet time. L'Jarius Sneed is not wrong. L'Jarius Sneed, the entire time he was a Kansas City Chief, the Chiefs had one good wide receiver and a bunch of other just dudes. And so, is he way off base? No, because he sure as hell wasn't guarding Travis Kelce in practice, or maybe he'd have a different answer.
Yeah, I don't think it's that big of a deal, though. Like, I hope people aren't like, oh, I mean, nobody should be offended by that whatsoever. I think the question for Sneed going forward, and most importantly, he got his money, right? You want the long-term security, especially if there's real knee questions, and there are, going forward and longevity. But it is interesting, because you're on the Tennessee Titans, so you got paid, but you're on a team that's not expected to do anything. And that was the trade-off you were willing to take.
Yeah. And long-term stability.
I don't blame him at all.
I probably would have made
the same decision. But as great as he was last year, is he somebody that, do you think, in October or November, we're still going to, or anybody in the league is still going to be paying much attention to? You know what I mean? Like, if you're on a team that is not one of the best in the league, and
you'd be one of the best players in the league.
Right. But anybody, you know, care? I mean? And I don't know. I'm not saying that's why you don't sign somewhere. I'm just saying, in general, are we going to be sitting here in 6 months being like, man, they really miss L'Jarius Sneed?
No, but Stace, maybe.
Yeah.
It's not out of the question. L'Jarius Sneed was a special player last year for the Chiefs.
Good.
He was, like, if we ranked out players 1 through 10, of one being the biggest reason why you won, just players, one being the biggest reason you won the Super Bowl, okay, Mahomes. I don't think I get past 4 or 5 before I mention L'Jarius Sneed's name.
I would agree.
Like, I mean, it's him, it's Rice, it's Jones. I mean, I'm not getting much further down than that. Kelce, right? Yeah. And then I'm right there with Snead.
I think the reason why I'm asking the question is because the number one corner maybe in all of football is still on this team.
Yes.
And so are they better with L'Jarius Snead on the team? Yeah, of course the defense will be better with L'Jarius Snead on the team. Are they, in their mind, going to be better long-term because they're not going to be paying him the money? I think that's obviously the thought process.
But are they better with, it's always because the $20 million. It's really, I wish it were that simple, right? Is it, but really the question is, are they better with L'Jarius Snead on the team or better with Mike Dana and some low-level veteran and some low-level veteran defensive lineman and one low-level veteran corner or veteran wide receiver? Like, it's not one or the other. It's, do you want Dana and a wide receiver or do you want Snead? Or do you want Dana and a defensive lineman or do you, you know, like another defensive lineman?
There's, there's the knee concern. We brought that up. But, like, I mean, that's...
How much longer does he have elite-level play in him?
And nobody is rooting for that. But if, you know, is he still a year from now or 2 years from now, is he still playing at a high level or playing games? I mean, those are real concerns that you have as well going forward. And, you know, the someone on the text line said, hey, the Chiefs got the very best out of him. Well, I mean, sure. I mean,
absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, he was, a sixth round pick, and he's now just signed a deal that's going to potentially pay him over $50 million. And because of his play and he was, even though he didn't get the all pro nod, he played like an all pro last year. Yeah, of course they got the very best. They maximize. That's what I mean. You got to know which players to retain and which ones not to, but when you draft someone, you hope you get maximum value out of them. And boy, oh boy, is that an example of getting the absolute max out of that draft pick. Sixth round pick. And you turned him into one of the best corners in football for a given season. And he helped you win a championship. And the reality is now you flip
multiple championships.
Yeah.
Great. Snead won 3. Was he here for the first one?
What was his draft class? So let's see.
I think it was.
Dana was 2020. When was Snead? Was Snead 2020 as well?
Yeah, maybe.
I get that confused.
He's been in the league 4 years, so that would make sense. 2019.
He was 2020. It was 2020. 138th pick.
Okay. So. It was like, I always got to remember the guys who have been here because there's very few who have been here for all three of the Mahomes era. That's a very small number. It's Jones, Kelce, Mahomes. Like, it's just not that many because players come and go in the NFL a lot, and you kind of run into that. I mentioned Kelce briefly on this end. I think this is fascinating from a how we pay attention to the mock draft sounder and what we're expecting out of the draft, 2.5 weeks from now? Yeah, 2 weeks from Thursday. We'll be out at the Landing in Liberty. If you would like a chance to win $610 plus some autographed Chiefs memorabilia, all you have to do is come to the Landing that day, fill out a draft card, get points for how many correctly you guess just right or teams they go to right, but you have to physically hand them in person. You can go to 610sports.com and just print off the form now and start thinking it through, or you can show up that night, get a form there, and fill it out. Either way, you'll have a chance to win the prize by showing up to the Landing in Liberty coming up on draft day 2.5 weeks from now. But I think a big part of if you think that Chiefs are taking wide receiver at 32 or that they should take wide receiver at 32, I think a big swing on that is a question the Chiefs had to answer for themselves that we can try to answer here now. What is your early season stat prediction for Travis Kelce next year? Because that, I think, determines your level of interest at wide receiver in 32. How many yards? How many touchdowns? How many catches for Travis Kelce right now? Look, I understand we'll have to... things change, new players come in, whatever. But if I made you guess it in April 8th, so what, like 5 months before the season starts, what do you think Travis Kelce finishes with?
Yeah, so I'll say 950 yards and 6 touchdowns, something like that.
Okay.
That's kind of where I'm at now for reference.
See, that doesn't mean that stat line doesn't scream draft a wide receiver at 32 to me.
Yeah, it depends on how confident you are in the Rashee Rice situation also playing out the way it might, which you and I have both said that if he does get suspended, I think I'd be stunned if it was anything more than 4 games. If it even happens next year, depending on the process, that might swing your number if all of a sudden you knew what exactly suspension looked like for Rice or, you know, you're also... I think figuring, okay, is Hollywood Brown playing in all 17 or is he playing in 13 games? So I think that statistically, by the way, that would be Kelce's worst season since his second year in the league. But that is still
be the third best season probably.
Yeah.
It'd be better than most tight ends in the NFL.
Yeah. Cause I think it sounds like you think he's going right back to 1,000 yards.
I do.
Yeah.
So the only hangup I had was It's funny, the Week 18 game in which he decided to forego the 16 yards to continue his 1,000-yard consecutive season showed a level of selflessness that makes me wonder if next year, if he's like, hey, I'm just as good of a cog in this offense at 900 yards, letting Hollywood get more targets, letting Rashee get more targets, and I run decoy and do what I need to do, and we can all be better as a unit.
Mm-hmm.
Even if I don't have the stats. He was willing to forego stats from the previous year. I still think he has 1,100 yards and 6 touchdowns. History would tell me over the last... So if I say 1,100 yards, since the age of 27, he has 1,100 yards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 out of the last 8 years. One of those years he had 1,038 and last year had 934. So obviously I'm banking on history and that a 34-year-old tight end is still going to continue that level of yardage total. I just can't shake it yet, which is why I've moved for, like, I'd be fine if they took a wide receiver at 32. I'm not going to come in here on Friday morning and complain if they take a wide receiver at 32, but I'm not as desperate for it as I have been over the previous years when I was worried about the other wide receivers. Some of that is because of Rice. You know, Rice had a really nice rookie year, and there's no reason to think he can't get 10% better, 12% better. I'm not saying he's going to just, like, he's going to be Julio Jones next year, but 10% better makes him an 1,100-yard wide receiver. Already, Hollywood Brown would conceive to eat up a lot more than any receiver behind Travis Kelce got last year. So, like, there is a little bit of, like, if those guys are having the kind of years I think they can have, doesn't Kelce's number come down a little bit? But I also just don't think Hollywood's number has to be as high as some people think it will be.
Yeah, my guess, in a weird way, is by the time we get close to the season, the number I just gave you probably ends up going down. I'll probably talk myself into it once I see Hollywood Brown more and if we find out more clarity on Rice. Because right now, I still have him pretty much with a very similar season as he had a year ago. It wouldn't surprise me if the yardage number, at least, not touchdowns. Because I still think I'd be surprised if Kelce finishes
touchdowns,
with less than 5 touchdowns.
Eight, 9, you know, touchdowns are harder to predict anyway. You're just throwing the number
out. What
if
he gets engaged? Does that bump the number up or down for next season?
They won a Super Bowl. He was great in the,
If Kelce and Swift get engaged, you think the yardage total actually, you add an extra 100 yards or you take 100 yards off?
Add 100. I'm more likely to add yardage for an engagement. That post-engagement high.
Oh, okay.
You know?
All right.
Drew knows it. You don't know what that's like.
I don't.
Know what that's like.
That's true.
You're feeling like you're on cloud 9 right after the engagement. You're feeling good.
Yes.
You're unstoppable. This marriage is going to last 40 years. You don't know. I don't think he's getting engaged this offseason. Sounds like.
Oh, you think it's going to be after next season?
Well, so originally I was on team. They were going to be engaged by the time
the season
started.
I thought you said by May. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, I did.
I guess you still have a couple weeks.
Yeah, but I read some more about it. I think that they want to. I think that they're more likely to be the let's get engaged after Travis's craziness winds down. A couple of years together. And she was with the last guy 6 years before they got engaged. And they didn't get engaged, but 6 years before. So I think it may be a post-Travis playing career.
Well, she was with the last guy for
Joe
6 months.
Joe Alwyn. I learned a lot more about Taylor Swift's love life during this Travis Kelce thing than I was ever intending to.
Yes.
You know,
how much time have you spent, do you think, in just looking up that sort of stuff?
It's hard to say. I was realizing just how much of her catalog I know now because in the new car, it has like the free trial of SiriusXM. So my kids are obviously interested in that. So she's been cycling between.
This is where we tell you don't listen to satellite radio. Boo.
Ah, come on.
Boo.
I'm just listening to music in the car with my kids.
No, you should listen to terrestrial radio, please. Thank
Only?
You. Yes.
It makes you feel a bit better, too.
Well, when the trial's up, I don't think I'm going to pay $23 a
Good
month
decision.
Anyway, so it's just a trial. But they have a Taylor Swift radio that my daughter was asking to listen to the other day. And I'm like, boy, I'm really starting to know a lot of her catalog.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And the satellite radio only plays Taylor's versions. They're making sure she gets that whole dime.
Smart.
You know?
Smart.
Do we only play Taylor's version on this show? We should. We should, you know,
from
we should
now
honor
on.
That. From now on, we only play Taylor's versions of Taylor Swift or my versions of Taylor Swift songs on this show.
Okay.
That's it. It's the only way we're doing it. Someone says, what if he proposes and she turns him down?
Nah, he's not proposing if there's a no is even in the question. No, who
that would be tough.
We've talked about this before.
Every once in a while, someone gets turned down because I think in the moment the panic sets in. But you better be damn sure the yes is coming.
Who's proposing if they don't already know it's a yes? Like, you're just not doing it right. I mean, I know that, and I haven't proposed before. I just know you don't propose unless you know it's a yes. You don't put yourself in that spot. You don't put her in that spot either.
Yeah. Especially if you're doing it publicly. I'll say that. if you're doing it in the privacy of your own home, you could be a little more sure you're getting to know and like or think that it's possible. Because here's the thing, Gold. There's always some part of you that doubts it a little. Because you
Wow, you had doubts.
Like, what happens if you get the no? That's the worst case scenario.
You weren't 100%?
I was like 98%,
okay,
you know?
Okay, Drew, were you like 100%?
I don't think you can be 100%.
But like, were you?
Yes, yeah, I was very confident.
Okay.
But if you, there's always a part of you, like, I think Cody's right, and you think you know what's going to happen, but there's always the off chance that it isn't the answer that you're expecting.
Like, seems like that's 100%.
Yeah.
We've talked about this thing.
There's always a possibility.
Rings have been talking about, but, you know, it's Schrodinger's cat. I don't know whether the cat's dead or alive. Yeah. Like, until you open the box,
I think you got to be at least 99% sure. At least.
Yeah, I was very high.
You got to be at least.
Very high.
Like, if you're like, I'm like 80%. No, it's not good enough.
Yes, agreed.
100%, by the way. You said, do you think Kelsey asked permission from Mr. Swift? I don't know if he asked permission, but I definitely think he makes a call. Does that make sense? Like, I didn't ask permission to propose to my wife. It's not like an ownership thing. I simply informed him it was going
to
happen.
It's a courtesy.
Yeah, to me,
it's a courtesy call.
Yeah, it's a courtesy. It's a little, you know, some people say it's old fashioned, but to me, it's a courtesy thing. Yeah, you're not actually flat out like permission. It's more of like a courtesy of letting them know.
I'm going to propose this weekend, and you should probably, you know, you might want to know that. So here you go. That's all.
Someone says, no, their love burns too hot. Travis and Taylor engaged by training camp.
Their love burns too hot. That's a great sentence about them.
Okay.
I will say, I think that do you think that going into this season, say they don't get engaged, it's a similar type of vibe with the team where everybody's freaking out because Taylor's at the game, or, you know, if they get engaged, I think...
You mean from the fan base?
Yeah, I think if they get engaged before the whole thing revamps again...
Yeah,
if it's the same thing.
I told you, it would be essentially a royal wedding, the U.S. version. If they had any kind of, like, there would be story after story about who's coming, who's invited, which stars will be, like, I mean, dude, it'll be.
Yeah.
There'll be huge hype. Massive hype.
But, I mean, if we're in week 7, are they still showing 10 camera shots of Taylor Swift?
Yeah. Also, show the same amount, which is like 15 seconds a game. They will do the same thing.
Yeah, right.
The 15 seconds a game that everybody acted like was 5 minutes.
They were showing Caitlin Clark's dad more than they showed Taylor Swift, I think.
That's right.
They did show Caitlin. Monsters. How dare you?
Coming up next, we'll get to what's trending, and then we'll get right back into what the Royals continue to do, which is get off to a great start this season. That's next here on Cody and Gold.
Hey, it's Vinny Pasquantino.
Don't forget to follow Cody and Gold on the Odyssey app so you can listen on demand to my terrific football takes throughout the year right here on 610 Sports Radio.
Brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
Congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs. Another year, another Super Bowl. Did you know that the Chiefs won the Super Bowl in their first year of their partnership with Window World? And here we are, 5 years in, the Chiefs are a dynasty, and they're still going strong with Window World as the official window of the Kansas City Chiefs. Window World windows are one of two windows with a Good Housekeeping seal of approval, ranked number one in number of windows sold in the country by Qualified Remodeler magazine. In just over 20 years of business, they have improved the look and thermal efficiency of over 54,000 customers right here in Kansas City. So be sure to call this number, 816-799-0820. Learn more about the double-strength glass that gives a strength that's not commonly used in replacement windows. Learn more about their products that are not only durable, but offer security, beauty, and energy efficiency. Give my friends at Window World a call. That's 816-799-0820, 816-799-0820 to learn more, or also go on the website, windowworld.com.
Low testosterone affects many men today, even men as young as 30. But finding someone you can trust for quality low T treatment isn't so easy. This is Jeff, the CEO of Promenic Restorative Men's Health, and that's why I'm pleased to announce the opening of our second location of Heartland Men's Health right here in Independence, Missouri. Because as a Promenic affiliate, Heartland Men's Health has the experience and expertise to get you the right treatment for your particular medical situation. Heartland Men's Health is a leader in treating low testosterone. In fact, we've successfully treated thousands of men for low T and seen the amazing impacts low T treatments have. If you're like most men, you'll sleep better, have more energy, and improve mental clarity, get better gains in the gym, and your sex drive will likely improve as well. So call us. Just $99 gets you a PSA and T test and a medical consult. And if you start on testosterone the day of your appointment, your visit is free. Call 844-447-6600 or go to heartlandmenshealth.com. That's heartlandmenshealth.com. We have two offices, Overland Park, Kansas, and our new office in Independence, Missouri.
Twin Peaks is the best in the game. Here, your favorite drafts are poured at a frosty 29 degrees, and rare barrel-aged whiskeys are served just the way you want them. It's bigger game days and bolder fight nights. I mean, where else can you find a scratch kitchen that always comes in clutch? Every day, from lunch to late night. Only at Twin Peaks, the number one sports bar.
Twin Peaks is always adding exciting cocktails to the menu, like the expertly balanced Sincoro Hall of Fame Margarita. Try it at your local lunch today.
Tonight is the bittersweet end of the tournament, but FanDuel lets you make it a little sweeter. Whether you're betting on your favorite or the underdog, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. Are you taking UConn to cut down the nets tonight? That's $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, or anything else that catches your eye. Just visit FanDuel.com/610Bob and bet on college hoops until they cut down the nets. That's FanDuel.com/610Bob. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com.
You're always better with the roof from JR.
We've all seen them. As soon as the big storm comes through, the storm-chasing roofers show up. Don't be a victim twice. Call locally owned, veteran-owned JR & Company. No one protects your home and you like JR.
JR's there for you. You're always better with a roof from JR.
In fact, JR & Company can let you know if you even need to be worried about storm damage. Online, visit jrhailcheck.com. Plug in your address and we'll pull a storm report. If there's nothing on the report, we'll give you hassle-free peace of mind. And if it looks like you got hit, we can come out and do a free inspection and help with any insurance claim. We'll never try to sell you a roof you don't need. But if you do need a new roof,
you're always better with a roof from JR.
Go to jrhailcheck.com.
As an educator, Mr. Nelson's teachings are still being quoted in schools.
Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world.
Mr. Nelson taught hope.
Everyone can rise above their circumstances if they are dedicated and passionate.
And giving our best efforts.
It's always impossible until it's done.
Mr. Nelson Mandela's teachings not only united a nation, they inspire us today. Inspiration. Pass it on from PassItOn.com.
Some people just know the best rate for you is a rate based on you with Allstate. Not one based on the driver who treats the highway like a racetrack and the shoulder like a passing lane. Why pay a rate based on anyone else? Get one based on you with DriveWise from Allstate.
Not available in Alaska or California. Subject to terms and conditions. Rates are determined by several factors, which vary by state. In some states, participation in DriveWise allows Allstate to use your driving data for purposes of rating. While in some states, your rate could increase with high-risk driving, generally, safer drivers will save with DriveWise. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
Are you someone who tries to drive all distracted by your phone? Someone who props it on the steering wheel or peeks down at it for a glance? Or just scrolls and scrolls? If so, you could be the next person to get into a fender bender, get a ticket, veer off the road, or even cause a crash that kills you or someone else. Enough already. Put the phone away or pay. Paid for by NHTSA.
The good folks at Wendy's have a revolutionary new product for you. Introducing the new Orange Dreamsicle Frosty. It's like a time machine that takes you all the way back to now, the year 2024. It's the classic, creamy, orangey flavor you remember. Dare I say, it's new timey. It's the flavor you grew up with, just all grown up.
Head over to your local Wendy's establishment and get yours while supplies last. The new Orange Dreamsicle Frosty. Here for the now, for now.
Limited time only at participating Wendy's.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios. Subscribe to the Character Concerns podcast on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts. KCSB Kansas City, WDAF-HG2 Liberty, always live on the free Odyssey app. What's trending?
All right, let's check in on the hot topics trending.
Number one on what's trending, the national championship is tonight out in Arizona, 8:20 tip-off. Yeah, that's not Eastern time. That's Central time. This has been this way for the last, 15 years. But it's always a yearly complaint.
College sports are so stupid.
Starts so late. UConn against Purdue. UConn has been the number one overall seed. They have run through this tournament. And this was the matchup, ultimately, we talked for the last week or so. Now that you kind of got to this point, I'm glad this is the matchup we got because it's the best chance, I think, of it being a competitive game throughout based on what Purdue has done. I still think UConn's winning and going to roll through and win back-to-back championships for the first time. We've had a team do that since Florida. And then the Dan Hurley Kentucky rumors can start even more.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, especially because you mentioned the back-to-back Florida, you know, the other guy that people want over there. And we'll talk about this more in what's trending, but Billy Donovan.
Yeah, why would he leave the NBA, though, and go back
to college?
He's
getting ready to get fired, probably.
I know. I guess that's the only reason.
But I just would never go back to college, not based on what you got to do now. Next up on what's trending, the Royals are off today, but they did just complete a four-game sweep against the White Sox. They'll take on Houston for a three-game home series starting tomorrow. Like I said, they've won four in a row, and then they made one addition yesterday, trading for Colin Selby from the Pittsburgh Pirates, who had been designated for assignment by them. He throws 96 miles an hour, I'm assuming. We'll ask J.J. Piccolo tomorrow. This is a move to just give you more bullpen options, depending. The Royals this entire year, one thing that's really interesting, maybe we get more into this tomorrow. Every move they've made so far this year is about making sure they have to use as little minor leaguers as possible. Sure seems like they want a full year of minor league development before start pulling the guys at a single, double, and even the guys who just got to AAA.
Not only do they need to be more competitive than they were a year ago, that goes without saying, but give yourself some time to rebuild the farm system. And so to do that, you do have to spend money in free agency or make trades, and that's what they have done. And off day today, as you said, and then they're back at it tomorrow. Next up on what's trending, we alluded to this during our conversation about the national title game, but Coach John Calipari reportedly leaving Kentucky for Arkansas. It's not 100%, but it sounds like everybody believes it will happen. He was facing an immense amount of pressure already at Kentucky after missing the Sweet 16 for four straight years, I think it is.
Yeah.
And so next year, you were pretty much looking at Elite Eight or Final Four or bust. And this is a scenario where it seems like both parties are happy. Like, Kentucky fans were ready to get rid of him. Arkansas, obviously, would be thrilled to have Coach Cal. The commitment, it sounds like the Walton family and others are willing to give them one of the largest NIL budgets at Arkansas, which will allow him. There's nothing that he did at Kentucky that he won't be able to do at Arkansas.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, based on the resources, the reports
are... Just bringing a bunch of McDonald's All-Americans.
And reports that the NIL budget that they're willing to give him. And so we'll talk more about this, but just massive shift in college basketball that Kentucky is going to move on, it looks like, from Coach Cal. And they're not, you know why they're happy? They're not going to have to pay him a dime if he leaves on his own.
Lastly, on what's trending, it's Eclipse Day.
It is.
And if for some reason you're listening to this show, do not have access to Google or have not been online for some reason, 1:54 is the time here locally. Then we will get the around 89 or 90% of totality. It'll obviously start in the 12 o'clock hour. So sometime this hour, we'll start getting some coverage of the sun.
I think 50% around 1:15-ish. Yeah,
so there you go. It's Eclipse Day here in Kansas City.
Wear the glasses. Don't look at the sun.
Should we go downstairs to look for some?
We should see if they're down there yet. I don't know.
I'd like
Now, we're going to be inside, and I don't think we can really see the sun from where we're at. We'll just see it suddenly get darker and darker.
One of us should have live reported from the roof.
True.
There's like a ladder, right? No. I'll go to the roof. I don't care.
You're volunteering me then.
Can we just have Drew take his camera up to the roof?
It has nothing to do with being afraid. I stood on the roof of the last one, but I'm just saying we're doing a live radio show. But so it makes sense to have Drew go up there.
Hmm. He's also in the live radio show, but probably
he's not on the air.
But he has a more important job though, because he has to like press buttons. We just can't go to break if Drew leaves.
That's right.
It's
gonna be a commercial-free hour.
Should we, starting at like 1 o'clock, take Drew's camera outside? So we can start showing. Oh. I don't know if the Wi-Fi will work that far,
this
but we can try.
I recall you saying like an hour ago that why should we even talk about the eclipse? Because people need to see it. And then you just suggest
I'm offering people to see it.
No, but you just offered to take a camera outside as if the same funny argument you were making earlier. They can look outside, dude.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, given those are different circumstances, as in,
no, but you're
if,
just
you
like,
can't,
as if
you can't physically go look outside, listening to two radio people describe a solar eclipse,
it's not about
it's
describing
a visual
it.
Element.
It's not about describing it as much as it is just like we're on the radio during the eclipse. We should probably not ignore it, act like it's not happening.
Well, I'm definitely not doing that. I'm offering people to see it.
Right. But you were, anyway, it's a dumb argument. That is what's trending here on Cody and Gold. So, yes, if you want us to take a camera outside so you can see what you can see outside your window, we can maybe do that later on today.
The eclipse from, you know, from the parking lot. I don't know. What would I point it at out there? The road? There's not much. I got to be honest. The visual scenery outside our building, it's not great. It's just some trees and a parking lot.
A Target.
Shawnee Mission Parkway or my brand new car. I just pointed at that and then slowly let the sun come over
Someone
it.
Someone says you might want to be careful with the camera anyway. Could damage the camera lens.
I'm not going to point it right at the sun. Like, you're not supposed to point your phone right at it either, right?
That's what we were told in 2017.
I need a new phone anyway.
Oh, so you're willing to sacrifice your phone?
Yeah, sure.
For this moment.
Why not?
Someone says they just passed one of the reader boards on 635. It was a warning. People of the solar eclipse, turn your headlights on. I guess for that 30 seconds, it will be dark or whatever it is. However long that darkness period lasts, I don't remember what it was. It was very quick.
Yeah, it's not. It's a couple of minutes, maybe, right? Of like darkness.
Yeah, and it won't be, and it's still not going to be as dark this go around because, like you said, it's what 89% versus the 100% that Hot Springs, Arkansas, and some other areas that are in the path of totality.
Did you consider, as into as you seem, did you consider driving to a different state
Hell
to
no.
see totality?
No way. No, I think
because you seem into it. That's why I'm asking.
No, I'm not going to drive somewhere. Like, could you imagine if I would have told you, hey, Cody, I'm taking today off so I can drive to Arkansas.
I don't care. Do the things that you like.
But no, I'm not. That's not. I wouldn't do that, though.
The only thing that I for in terms of like something like this that you can go and see, I know it's like once in a lifetime, this sort of thing, or it's claimed to be that going to see the Northern Lights would be a lot of fun.
But
you can go
that
and see
I'm with
that.
You. I'm with you on the Northern Lights. You know. I think that would be. Honestly, cool.
I'd rather
see
that than
the
this.
Problem locally is we had a better eclipse.
Yeah.
7 years ago. Mm-hmm. Like the result, I saw it. It was better. And it was less than a decade ago.
That's what makes this one not as big of a deal.
But also,
for
like,
some.
The next one in North America, I could be dead by then. So.
2044? You're not really giving yourself much credit here. That's 20 years?
I said I could be dead. I'd say I will be. I said I could be.
So you said you could be. And then you said earlier, what if you knew you were going to die at 78.
Mm-hmm.
This is a pretty... around the same conversation.
Most people think about death. That's pretty normal.
Yeah. A lot of people have the same joke. I agree. The text line, yes, there should be a band, if not already, called The Path of Totality. Yes, it is
I'm
perfect.
Assuming there is.
It's perfect.
There has to be.
Yeah. Was it on... It was on a weekday last time, too.
Yeah.
Never happens on a weekend.
Yeah,
I
wasn't working that day. It's like,
it was
for some reason, I think it was a Wednesday. I don't know why that's popping into my head.
I don't remember what day it was.
Anyway, so we'll keep an eye on that. It'll suddenly get darker, and we will keep doing the
You'll
show.
See it.
And the world will not end, despite what some people over the weekend were freaking
out
about.
Can't be sure about
earthquake.
That.
You're right. I can't be like the proposal thing. 99% sure. I can't be sure if we're going to stay on the air either. I have no idea. You know.
But what would that disrupt about the on air part?
Bob and Josh were joking about that as we were stepping into the studio. They said, "Do you think we'll just get knocked off the air? Sunspots.
That would be interesting.
The opposite, actually.
I mean,
less
it'll
sun.
Literally be the end of our show, so I don't care.
Sorry, Carrington."
Like just,
that's what you just said.
Dead serious at the end of our show. Whatever.
Yep.
Someone, you'll fry Drew's camera pointing the sun. I just said I wouldn't point it at the sun. I just said I'd put it outside. That's it.
They're just trying to make sure, man. Just trying to.
No, the listeners helped us very much by supporting us in our many bartending ventures or a thousand other things so that we could have the video stream for the show every day. I would hate to ruin Drew's camera by pointing it at the sun.
I was looking. So the Royals are off today, and it's unfortunate because they're playing really well. But also, there's no baseball games, I think, that are occurring today during it because that, to me, would have been interesting. There's one game at, like, 4:11 this afternoon. I was hoping a day game at Kauffman Stadium during the eclipse. Now that...
How come nobody does that
now
on purpose?
That would be great. Yeah, exactly.
Because you would think that if you just had a moment in the game...
You'd pause for a little bit, because they're obviously not going to want you throwing a pitch and all of a sudden...
No, I think you throw a pitch, you create the...
They're not going to do
unique
that, though.
...unique visual experience.
Well, I mean, the visual would be cool. I just think at that exact moment where it got super dark, they just have to, actually, you know what? They wouldn't have to stop. They just have the lights on. Sure. Just keep playing all of a sudden. And
yeah, just crank the lights on.
So there's not one.
At 12:30 and just keep playing.
The Royals got the sweep, of course, of the White Sox over the weekend. And they're off today before beginning a series with the Astros. And it's hard not to be very excited with what you're seeing because the results, it doesn't seem as fluky maybe as past starts where they got off to a better April. When you look at how they're doing it, starting pitching, not that they're going to have five Cy Young candidates or four Cy Young candidates, but if you're having this quality of pitching from four guys, to me, you're way more likely to at least have one or two of these individuals that are going to consistently pitch at a high level. It's not just like, hey, only Cole Reagans is pitching well, and so, okay.
What happens when he doesn't?
No, you got, I mean, Seth Lugo, Cole Reagans, Michael Walker, all of them, Brady Singer, they're all pitching at an extremely high level.
All you really need in any rotation is three guys going at the same time. This is like bats. You need five or six guys in your order going. You need three of your starting rotation going, and you need, 70% of your bullpen going in order to win a lot of games at any particular time. I presume that this is sustainable. Not the level of starter, okay? I mean, you and I both know. They're not going to have, a 1.7 or whatever the hell it is now, ERA, out of the starting rotation. I get it. Yesterday was the worst start they've had by far because he went 4 1/3 or 4 2/3 and allowed 3 earned runs in a game in which they won. That's the worst start they've received all season. I think what's important about this sweep is I will not let, because there's a lot of people who want to be, it doesn't mean they're going to win 90 games and go to the postseason. But choosing to be negative because, the White Sox stink. Baseball is really hard, okay? I've covered it a really long time. Winning 4 in a row against the worst team in the sport is hard. Just for instance, the Tigers lost 2 of 3 to the A's. The A's stink. They're miserable. The Tigers are ahead of the Royals in the division. Even they can lose a series to the A's. And the Royals could still lose one later to the White Sox. They take them on in, a week. It's not to say that. But to get a four-game sweep, when we thought being greedy was getting 3 out of 4 last Friday, says a lot about where their confidence is growing. And the fact that they're winning the same way every night is what makes it feel sustainable. They're not having to win a bunch of different ways yet. They're going to win behind their starting pitching and getting some key hits. If some other portion of their offense trigger fires all at the same time and they start scoring more runs, then these starting pitching performances are going to be even easier to win.
No matter how you feel about the White Sox, what you were saying, I mean, they swept a team that if you are better, you should win the series. Not always requiring a sweep, but you should win these series. In the past, and when the Aprils have gone really bad, these are the type of series, even though they were playing a team perceived to be bad, they would either lose or they'd cough up the ability to split. Whatever it may be, you went out and you took care of business against a team that, you are flat out better than. And it can dictate the entire tone for the season this early. April 8th, it doesn't decide the division or mean you can't win it or all. No, but we all know from a fan support and from a confidence in the clubhouse, getting off to a good start was so important this year. A lot of teams, everybody wants to get off to a good month of April. But this particular team, I think it was as important as any team in baseball based off a prior lack of April success. And so this is massive. I mean, you're starting to see some fan support hopefully increase out at the K if this team can continue to stay hot the way they have. I know this is a weekday series. I'm not saying that suddenly there's going to be 30,000 people going to the game. But if you have a strong month of April, you're going to start seeing it turn. I mean, I was talking to some friends over the weekend, and they're like, you know what? I might have to sign up for Bally's if they keep playing this well or whatever. You know, I'm talking about the TV app. There's a lot of people that are like, oh, I might subscribe to that if suddenly the team gets hot.
Look, I still get, this is the thing that always still confuses me about that just in general. Because I literally saw someone on social media this morning be like, now please get a deal with YouTube TV so I can watch the games. You can watch the games. The Royals' job is to make you do exactly what your friends just said. Make you want to spend that $20, giving you so much value that you have no choice but to watch the games. That's what their job is. The difference between, because it'd be easy to just be like, woo, pump the brakes. They were 15-9 in April in 2021 for a team that finished with 74 wins, which, by the way, 74 wins over the last couple of years we would have happily taken. The massive difference, though, is look at the two different rosters. This team is so much younger. MacArthur and Reagans and Marsh and Singer. They have some older guys, right? I'm not trying to pretend like the bullpen's not older or Michael Walker's not older. They just have no, or Salvi, right? It's not like they have none. But the core pieces, the people that matter the most, are young players. Vinny and Bobby and Michael Garcia. That's what makes them more like the 2012 Royals than 2021, when they got off to a good start. Yeah. And you're like, can they sustain it with a bunch of older veteran players and a starting rotation that, if you go back and look at 2021, you'd have realized didn't have much of a hope to continue that record through the season? This rotation is completely different. That's really honestly where my confidence comes from. Sure. And 1 through 5 of the order.
Yeah.
That they're 5 best hitters. 4 of them are born in what, 97 or 98 or later.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. And it makes some people feel pretty old listening, hearing about that. But yeah, that's true. And you know, the thought is, if you're looking at who you expect to count on in a given season, you know, you mentioned some of the names there. Obviously, you expect Bobby Witt Jr. to play at a certain level, and he is. You expect Salvi to play at a certain level, and he is. I still think there's an expectation with Vinny, but we're 10 plus days into the season. Let's see what the rest of the month brings before anybody starts. Someone tweeted at me. They said, when are you guys going to start talking about Vinny?
I had it in the rundown at first today. We can talk about it tomorrow.
Yeah, we can.
Not yet.
I think we're a couple weeks away from actually being, you know, concerned about that. He's off to a slow start. But why are you able to be okay with that slow start? Because then you got a guy like MJ Melendez or others that are stepping up.
Yeah.
And that's how you're able to get through this. Because as you said earlier, I mean, you're not going to have 7 guys all hitting at the same time. You're going to have moments. You're going to have hopefully the mainstay where Bobby Wood Jr. is pretty much going to be himself all year because he's one of the best players in baseball.
The top 5 in your order, they get a chance to be here for the next 5 years. You know, like that same run that we talked about, 5 to 7 years. Who's going somewhere? Vinny, Michael Garcia, MJ Melendez, and Bobby Wood Jr. are all under contract. Like there's not, you know, like the top 4 or 5 of your order, I mean, a good chunk of that could not be leaving anywhere. That's why I'm more optimistic. Honestly, this is all, like, the truth is, a lot of this is just, like, all we've been asking for a couple of years now. Because it's been a rough couple of years for the Royals is. Don't make me give up on you by Memorial Day. That's just step one. Don't make me quit on you by Memorial Day.
I mean, I would argue based on recent history, it's by May 5th. I mean, that's where people were.
I couldn't even get to Cinco de Mayo.
Yeah, the bar is, as we said, is so low of what fans are ultimately asking them to do. Now, can expectations continue to grow as we get further into this thing? Sure. But initially, I truly think it was, hey, just don't be done with it once April's over. You know, can you have belief?
Like by the end of last April, we knew that they were cooked.
Yeah. So, okay, for starters, can you get through April and be around 500? Well, right now, they're 2 games above 500. It's still only April 8th. And then, yeah, then, Cody, the next benchmark is Memorial Day weekend. And then the next benchmark is July. Like, we'll work our way up, and expectations will continue to grow.
Someone did ask. They said, hey, quick check. Playoff standings, would the Royals be in if it started today? Good news for you, yes. If the playoffs were to start today, 10 games into the season, mind you.
Okay.
The Royals would be the wild card team in the 6th spot.
Okay, so they'd be going on the road. They would be. We would not get a home game. We would not get a playoff game at Kauffman yet. Okay, good to know.
The playoffs would be Yankees, Guardians, Red Sox, and Tigers as the division winners. Or no, I'm sorry. Yankees, Guardians, Red Sox as the division winners. Tigers would actually be the first wild card ahead of them. The Rangers would be a wild card. Rangers would win their division, and then the Royals would be behind them. So
basically, did I do that right? The Royals would be going into the Yankees for the opening round. Is that right?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay. Great. Awesome.
Just again, like, look at where, like, a couple of teams in the league are, like specifically the A's and the White Sox. That was the Royals. Like, I go back to when JJ Piccolo took over this job and the level of team play they were getting when he took over this job. They were those two teams. They were the White Sox and the A's. We were like, oh God, it's miserable. And it's going to be miserable this whole damn season. And in 2 years, mind you, the story is not complete. In 2 years, they're at least competitive through 10 games, which is more than the previous 2 years.
Yeah, let's not get ahead of her. I mean, they won 56 games last year. But
no,
yeah.
But I'm just saying, I also know what he inherited.
Yeah.
I've told you before, like, I was always going to take some time to do it. Maybe the most positive side of all of this is run differential. They are a far more, like, they have the 4th best run differential in baseball. They're just way more competitive. Now I just need them to, the first time they take on, like, the Guardians or the Tigers, the two teams that currently reside above them in the division. That will be the interesting first test. Is what happens when you start taking on those teams in the division, do you expect to compete at the top of it? And look, the Twins were expected to compete at the top of it too, and they lost 2 of 3 to them. It's early.
I'm
just saying, like, I'll be really interested in those series early on, is what they tell me about the Royals.
It's just as I said, let's start with April, and let's start with April and see where this team can end up. And based off of the last couple of years, can they, you know, be we said around 500? Right now they're above 500, and right now they're pacing for 97 wins. Let's just see where this thing continues to go. But it's nice to have some positive things to be talking about, even
sure
on April 8th. Okay, and hopefully it's something that when it's May 8th, we're talking about positive things still. That's where I'm going to start small. That's where I'm
What's
at.
Your new April goal? You got a new April? Should we do that tomorrow?
Sure. Yeah.
I want a new April goal. Is an fair. Interesting thing. Think about that. 913-586-7610. I think we can get that tomorrow.
That works.
April goal
for the Royals, not yeah. just in general.
Yeah, do you have April goals that you just didn't?
Oh, sure. New Year's resolutions. I just have April goals.
Well, that was. I know we were talking about the Royals, but that also the way that it was.
Your April goal should be to get discounted rent or to get the hell out of your apartment. Yeah,
break that lease, man.
You keep telling us more and more stuff about this place. It sounds like it sucks.
It does more than that.
Now, I will say the problem with the noisy neighbor, which you had mentioned a couple of months ago.
That's the least of the problems
I
now.
Think that's just apartment living. Am I
thin walls, thin walls, and you're on the first floor. I mean, unfortunately.
And it's hardwood, which makes it worse.
Yeah, what are they doing that's so annoying? Other than just like, are they just existing?
Well,
are they just like walking heavy? They can't help that.
Yeah,
are they
a bunch
playing
of kids
loud
running
music?
Around.
It's
look, if they're like spinning DJ music till 2 in the morning, we got a different problem.
Well, I think it's existing. It's just that they're every single day there is the dragging. It sounds like furniture is being dragged across the floor every single day at some point. I don't know
maybe
what
maybe there's leaks in their apartment. They got to move the furniture.
You know what?
On a regular basis.
We should all band together.
You should form a tenant union.
Start walking around each apartment and knocking on the door. Do you have any leaks?
Do you have any leaks? Can we all put mold tests in our apartments so we can get this place condemned and get the hell out of here?
The fact that somebody did as well guess on the text line, out of all the apartments in Kansas City, the one that I currently reside in is crazy.
That guy just knew. He's like, by the way, if it's this place, get out.
And somebody else was about to move in. It was in their top three.
You might have saved somebody twice. Saved someone from getting scammed. Now save somebody from moving into a terrible apartment. If you're thinking about moving in the Overland Park area and you're not sure which one Drew's talking about,
double
check into the show. Mm-hmm. He'll let you know which one not to move into. That's for sure.
Coming up next, we'll get into the big shift happening in college basketball. Looks like Kentucky's going to have a vacancy. And luckily for one of our local schools, their coach is not going anywhere.
Hey, it's Brady Singer. You're listening to Cody and Gold. Weekdays starting at 10 on 610 Sports Radio and the Odyssey app.
Brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
You know what I could point the camera at if we're out there for the eclipse? The parking lot. Because parking lots are on the mind sometimes, and especially when you're working in your business, you want to work with a great local company over at Gann Asphalt and Concrete. I know them all personally. They've been in the Kansas City area for now 30 years. They are locally owned and operated. When it comes to projects like that, you want to work with local companies you know you can trust who are going to be in the area to deal with, not be dealing with people out of state, not be dealing with contractors who can't complete every part of the job. Gann is one contractor. All things parking lot. They will take care of your streamlined project so you can hire one contractor and take care of the entire thing. Get the cracks filled and then get the seal coating and then get the new signage so that it can be a good reflection on your business. If you want to go to GANNAsphalt.com, you can see the level of work they'll do, and I'm telling you, they'll do anything. But what the customers say about them, what the guests say about them, and how they can take care of these things. They can keep those maintenance projects up so big problems don't become smaller, or take care of those big problems that somebody else maybe ignored before you or you'd put off too long. Work with a local company that's been serving the Kansas City community for 30 years and go to GANNAsphalt.com. That's GANNAsphalt.com.
Hi, it's Trey Smith. And in order for our team to get a victory, we need honesty, teamwork, work ethic, humility, and the golden rule. That's why my truck is from the dealer that embodies all those values, Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. And Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram also supports Giving Hope, whose sole purpose is to feed and clothe the needy in Wyandotte County and beyond. Giving back in the highest integrity, that's how Jeff and his team do business. For your next vehicle, visit or go to VictoryChryslerDodgeJeepRam.com.
It's playoff time in the NBA and NHL. Baseball's in full swing, and FanDuel is your place to bet on every game. Right now, new customers get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed. That's $150, win or lose. Bet on everything from slap shots to home runs to slam dunks, all on an app that is safe, secure, and easy to use. So what are you waiting for? Visit FanDuel.com/610Bob and make your first bet an automatic win. FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700. That's 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com.
No one does happy hour like Twin Peaks. Whatever your preference, we have everything from tequila cocktails and an extensive bourbon category to top shelf spirits and cocktails served over ice balls. Local craft beers and handcrafted whiskey cocktails round out an adventurous drink menu second to none. And don't forget about our 29 degree man-sized drafts. Our happy hour will have you coming back for more. Twin Peaks, eats, drinks, scenic views.
What does it mean to be the official information technology provider for the Chiefs? It means everything. Technology Group Solutions makes sure everything runs flawlessly for the millions of fans that attend games and the hundreds of millions of fans that comprise Chiefs Kingdom around the world. Technology Group Solutions can deploy that same dedication, problem-solving, and incredible service to ensure your business runs smoothly. Technology Group Solutions, powering Chiefs Kingdom, and ready to do the same for you.
Replace your worn-out brakes and save now on BrakeBest Select. BrakeBest Select Pro are import direct brake pads and rotors only at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Are you the parent of a 2 to 7-year-old? Listen closely for an exciting free radio offer. By now, you've probably heard of ABC Mouse, the Parents' Choice Award-winning online learning program that's actually changing the lives of early learners everywhere.
ABC Mouse is like a little one-on-one teacher. It has helped her so much.
Right now, we're offering a special radio promo to try it free for a month. But you have to go to abcmouse.com/radio to claim your free month. That's abcmouse.com/radio.
Sponsored by Age of Learning.
Replace your worn-out brakes and save now on BrakeBest Select. BrakeBest Select Pro are import direct brake pads and rotors only at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Do you owe back taxes or have unfiled tax returns? The IRS won't quit until they get your money. Here's great news, fresh from those in the know. Major changes have happened at the IRS. If you owe more than $10,000, you may be eligible for a 99% reduction of what you owe. Haven't filed a return for a while? Their happy clients are talking.
The IRS was going to levy my bank account, but Guardian was able to prevent that and fix all my IRS issues. Thanks again, Guardian Tax.
Need relief from crushing tax debt? The IRS now has special programs. Guardian Tax knows all about them. Personal or business, this is the fresh new break you've been hoping for.
We aren't the company you call when you need a hug because you're scared of the IRS. Guardian Tax is the company that wins when you need it most.
Guardian Tax Service is really great to work with. They really helped me out. I'd recommend them highly.
Call now for a free confidential consultation. 800-494-7174. 800-494-7174. 800-494-7174.
Hi, I'm Henry Winkler. My eyes are very important to me. My eyes connect me with everything I love. I loved my late father-in-law dearly. He always lit up a room, but his vision dimmed with age. He had age-related macular degeneration, or AMD. And since partnering with Apellis, I've learned there's an advanced form of dry AMD called geographic atrophy, or GA. His struggle with vision loss made me want to help others know about GA's warning signs. For some, colors appear dull or washed out. For others, hazy or blurred vision make it hard to see details, like fine print on price tags. Many have trouble seeing in the dark, making driving at night difficult. GA gets worse over time and cannot be reversed. If you think you have GA, don't wait. Treatments are available. Ask a retina specialist about FDA-approved treatments for GA and go to gawon'twait.com.
As an educator, Mr. Nelson's teachings are still being quoted in schools.
Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world.
Mr. Nelson taught hope.
Everyone can rise above their circumstances if they are dedicated and passionate.
And giving our best efforts.
It's always impossible until it's done.
Mr. Nelson Mandela's teachings not only united a nation, they inspire us today. Inspiration. Pass it on from PassItOn.com.
Question of the day coming up in about 8 minutes or so. I feel like we could just do the rest of the show on Drew's apartment and get the solution to this fixed.
Dude, there's other people in the text line saying they live there too and saying it's
they all think it sucks. They all are having problems.
Does this place have any chance of ever buying advertisement from the station, or can we just bury it?
I'm not gonna mention their name on the air, I don't think. But
I think
it's not
if I lived there.
It's an older complex, and
it's one that's being renovated, or they claim is being renovated.
Oh, by the way, is it the time of year when I request a listener who lives somewhere near my area to get me a pool key fob?
Not yet, not a month away.
I'm willing to pay. So just as a precursor, when we get to that time of the year when I tell you the neighborhood that has a pool near my neighborhood that I would like pool access to, and that I'm willing to pay your HOA fee for the pool in order to get there, I am willing.
We're back to this, Drew. We're trying to help you out, and Cody is there just trying to get his apartments or his house situation.
Big news, though. Desmond has made a friend at school.
Oh, good.
Nice. What he calls his best buddy.
Nice.
Desmond's best buddy at school is named William. William's parents have a pool.
Perfect. There you go.
At their
Problem
house.
Solved.
Not like in the neighborhood. They got one at their house.
Nice.
So I'm just going to have to nurture that friendship.
That's good for your kids. I don't know if it's good for you.
What do you mean? My kids are too little. They can't go to the pool by themselves. Like,
there's someone else's parents there. Do you not trust that if they become best friends?
With swimming?
I don't know. You tell me.
I mean, my kids can't swim yet. Did you think in a pool?
Did you just now assume because your son just made a new friend, and you
I
think
just,
that
I can't just always just leave my kids there? Sometimes I get to be apart,
and you think now you just can throw on the flip flops and go grab a beer and just chill by their pool?
I don't think I can just be there without them, but I think if they're invited over, there's a good chance I'm also coming.
You got to become friends with the parents. Yeah.
Well, so I already get along with them. But we need to schedule the hey, let's have drinks at someone's house situation. Don't worry, that's next. That's next. Man, Drew's really going through it with somebody who already lives there.
They have the same problem as me.
You guys should go in together. So they're going in to talk to the management today too. Boy, working the front desk at this place must suck. It must just be the
worst. I will say.
Well, they got the routine down now. It sounds like
we're working on it. Contacted maintenance.
I went in after they said it was fixed and it wasn't. And as soon as I walked in, I could just see the person's face. They were like, hello. And they're like, oh, crap, it's this guy. They had to have been thinking about it again. Well, look.
The photos make it look kind of nice. I looked up the photo.
Complex can make the photo. Cody, every complex can look great on the photos on the website. If the photos on the website look crappy, then you know it's,
correct.
Really, really bad.
If the photos look bleak, you're like,
and believe me, I would, you see me and not liking it is just the same as me having to keep on coming in and telling you problems. I don't want to do it. I don't enjoy doing this. I don't know anybody who would.
Yeah, I mean, some people like confrontation. I've met people who enjoy confrontation.
Somebody wants to go in with me now, okay.
But yeah, I'm not generally I try to avoid it, but when the time comes, it's done. Someone says, let's do a show car smash to fund an in-ground pool for Cody. Yay! Or the station. Can we just have outside here? Would you continue hang out at work if there was free access to a nice pool?
No.
You'd go straight to the apartment instead.
I have two pools at my complex.
I know, but it's here. You don't have to go anywhere.
Yeah, I'd rather go home. On a Friday at 4 o'clock, I don't want to be hanging out still.
My
at
backyard's
work.
Too small for the pool. I'd have to get rid of one of the decks.
Yeah.
And it would have to be the way that your yard is. Would it be in ground or it would have to be?
Yeah. Have to be in ground. Plus, I mean, what's the point? If you're gonna get a pool, this person. By the way, the Desmond's friend who I was talking about, in ground. Nice pool.
Yeah, if at that point, around the decks, you get the pool and it's built into the deck. That's what
you got a hole in the deck.
You've seen those what I'm talking about, where the deck kind of in the pool.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Someone says, I prefer not to see my coworkers in a swimsuit. You just get in there.
We'll get to the random question of the day.
And I did not neglect this. Hold on, one more. Cody spent all of his money in a new car, neglected paying for a pool membership for his children. Actually, my kids have a pool membership. We are members of the Gladstone Community Center, in which my kids do swim lessons.
Yeah, why can't you just go there?
It's not far away. I want a walkable pool, okay?
Yeah, don't we all?
I want summertime walkable pool access. That's all. We can go to that pool, and we do.
I feel like if this was this much of a priority, you should have bought your house in a neighborhood that had a pool.
That wasn't on the table.
But then you'd
be
dealing with the HOA.
Yeah, and I don't want that.
Yeah.
I want like a good... I want pool access without the stress of it. Someone says, I ain't swimming in any public pool. Any? Sir, we probably just grew up at different classes. I grew up what we call poor. So I don't... Private pool? I didn't have that till I was like...
I mean, your apartment pool is still a public pool.
Uh-huh. It's not. Well, I'm assuming that person's saying
they're not
in the apartment.
I understand that's a little more exclusive, but that's still, I view it as still a public pool, even though it's, I know what you mean by a community pool.
I went to two pools the most in childhood. One was in Gracemore, the neighborhood over by the Ford plant. Million kids. And even worse than that was the one we used to go to. It doesn't even exist anymore, by Hyde Park. It was three levels of concrete, and it was literally people soup. You were only there to cool off because none of us had air conditioning. It was just a means to an end. You couldn't even swim. You couldn't, like, do a lap. You just sat in the water.
You just stand there?
Dude, it was better than being in a hot-ass house.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
You see what Coach Cal is doing? It's very nice of him.
That is shocking result yesterday, late last night.
So Cal is leaving Kentucky for Arkansas, and reports out of Lexington are that he invited players over to his house at 2 o'clock today for a meeting. So I don't think they're just going to hang out and watch the eclipse. This is his goodbye meeting, and then we'll see how many of his players actually transfer and follow him to Arkansas. Reports are he's signing a multi-year deal to leave Kentucky, to stay in the SEC, to go to Arkansas. Remember, he has been disappointing the last couple of years by Kentucky standards, although I still think their fans are
delusional.
Way out of whack and, yeah, delusional.
Most elite fan bases are, I think, but
yes.
Sure.
And so he was potentially going to get fired after next season anyway, and so now he avoids that. He leaves to Arkansas, and reports are that the NIL fund that they're willing to come up with, the Walton family, among others, is going to be one of the best in the country. And so Eric Musselman left Arkansas for USC, which opened up this job. And remember,
felt like a worse job.
Yeah.
Too.
And now it looks like Arkansas is willing to make, financially at least, Arkansas as competitive as anybody in the country from an NIL and a coach salary perspective. But this has major ramifications for the rest of college basketball, because if Kentucky's open, everybody, you know, Nate Oates or Scott Drew.
Domino effect.
You know, there's
a big
huge
name
trickle
gets
down. Yeah, there's a huge trickle down effect.
But it does require a big name being plucked. It requires like Hurley leaving UConn and going to Kentucky, mm-hmm. and then another big boy. You know, like for the domino effect, it requires whoever Kentucky hires to be from an actual major program that has the proper trickle down. Does this mean NIL is going to matter more than program history? I asked that because in order for Kentucky to lose its coach, three straight people, I think, took a worse job. Andy Enfield left USC for SMU. I thought a worse job. Then I thought Musselman left for USC, a worse job. And now Coach Cal left for Arkansas, a worse job. Presumably all on paper. Those were worse jobs. But now, in addition to paying you more money, which was always part of the game, they're now also guaranteeing you a certain amount of money you are allowed to spend in NIL, which might be more than you are allowed to spend at the next job. And all of a sudden, just your pay isn't the only reason why you might leave a job, or just the team you're with might not be the only reason.
I think it's that. I also think it's just, hey, you know, you always are in these coaching carousels every offseason. So a lot of times you see a coach trying to get out before he gets fired, right? Like he knows the clock is ticking, and so he's getting out before he gets fired. I think that is happening a little bit with Cal. But also I think like not every coach is going to want to handle what it means to deal with that fan base in Lexington. You know, that's not for everybody. Yeah, it's a blue blood program, no question, and the history there is unbelievable.
Yeah.
But not everybody wants to deal with that if they feel like they can accomplish similar goals elsewhere.
Sure.
For some coaches, yeah, their goal is, hey, I want to perceive four best jobs in the country. I want to be at the top of my level.
I want to be one of the five biggest programs in college basketball history. Because like Drew said earlier, like, why would you want that pressure? Because some people do.
Yeah.
Some people, like, the reason why they got to this level of competitiveness is because they strive to be challenged in the biggest thing. Now, Hurley can just be like, I'm already challenged in that way. I'm competing for NCAA tournament titles every year. I'm already at the highest. I already get challenged. Yeah, he's getting ready to win. Well, I think he's getting ready to win.
Tonight, I think they will.
And to that point, Cody, if you go to UK and you win, you are.
Yeah, but you're the king. Legend. I mean, he won it. Yes, you're a legend, but also let's not forget, it's been a while, but Cal won. He won the title. That's not good enough at Kentucky, though, right?
I mean, he's got to win more than one. Bill Self would have been a lot more in a hot seat if he hadn't won a second.
Absolutely. Mm. This last one he won in 2022 or whatever changed that. Otherwise, you'd have people getting restless. But, man, in Lexington, I mean,
it's a whole other level. Yeah. Lexington and Louisville are, I would say that those are the two most passionate fan bases for basketball in the country.
It is.
And they hate each other. And
it's going to be, it's a rare situation, though, when this is finalized, where both fan bases are actually really happy. Because Kentucky fans are glad they're not going to pay $33 million to Cal. They wanted them gone anyway. And Arkansas, of course, you're thrilled. You got one of the better coaches in the game. And because the boosters believe in him more than they did Musselman, reports are he's going to have a $6 to $8 million NIL budget, which, as we know this, the way this transfer portal works, it's not really recruiting as much as who can offer the most money.
Based on the way that this got talked about, going back to Jerome Tang's part of this, right, who reportedly maybe had a shot at this job.
He was a finalist. He was a top candidate.
Yeah. It seems like once they missed out of the two or three names that they kind of liked there, right, at Arkansas, like, ooh, they like Tang, and Tang got himself paid and sent out a corny video, but it's fine.
Oh, did you see the video?
Give me 1 second, and then I want to hear it. But okay. Yeah, I did see it. It's really bad. But then if he took the job, then it must have just been like, this is where the boosters are still king in college sports. They missed out on a couple of people they could afford, and they didn't need to ask anybody for more money. And they're like, we're not getting anybody. And just the chicken nugget people are like, hey.
The chicken nugget people. Tyson.
They were like, true. They were like, hey, Tyson here's Foods. A big mountain of money. We'll give you every damn year. Go get Coach Ken. It's like, what? They're like, we're boys. It's fine. You're like, oh, my God. Wait, what? You're telling me Calipari will come? He's like, dude, it's fine. Here's the chicken nugget money. Move on.
Your alumni and your alumni matters more than it ever has.
I mean, I think Cal, though, can do everything he did at Kentucky at Arkansas. You know what I mean? Like, I think he can have the same type of success there.
And college basketball is the only sport, I think, because you're not going to see Kalen DeBoer go co-coach for the next 10 years, win one title, and then be like, you know what? I'm going to go from Alabama, and I'm going to go to Virginia Tech. You know, I want to do that. That's not going to happen. But in college basketball, you can still be competitive. Like Nate Oates, for example. Alabama basketball was nothing. He shows up and he makes it into a team that goes to the first Final Four.
Right.
And it's good coaching, but also the use of the portal and what they've provided him, that you don't have to be at a great all-time program to be able to make this sort of a run. Or in football, Virginia Tech has a lot of great history, but they haven't. You know, you're not going to be able to make that same sort of a run at Virginia Tech because you have 70 players instead of 15 players, and the NIL money is a lot less per player in football than it is for college basketball. So,
just out of curiosity,
Cal out a lot. It does. Or any other coach.
Yeah, it does. I mean, that's versus and maybe Oates leaves Alabama because Alabama's always going to be a football school, and NIL money's always going to go there. You know,
sounds like it could be official tomorrow. Maybe there could even be a press conference tomorrow for Cal.
Do you think Self could actually, if I don't know how much money they're offering him in NIL, but is there any way, shape, or form that he leaves Kansas?
No. Don't think so. I think Self's no.
There he will life. Finish his career at Kansas. Yeah,
I'd be stunned.
Yeah,
stunned.
He's not leaving Kansas for Kentucky.
Again, at least that would make more sense than Coach Cal leaving. People leave five program in college basketball history for another top five program in college basketball history, but Self's not going anywhere. 0%.
Cal's leaving Kentucky because expectations have gotten out of whack. The fan base hates him, and he's a year away from maybe being fired. That's why he's leaving.
On a scale from Leonardo DiCaprio in Wolf of Wall Street not leaving, that being the 10, to a 1 as in being, you know, like this is an utter embarrassment. Where do you rank Jerome Tang's I'm coming back Twitter video?
It sounds like he played this well, though, right? He was very close to maybe taking the Arkansas job, and they may perceive that way, and he got himself an extension. But he announced the news himself. It was like a photo gallery slideshow with music behind it on his Twitter account. 'Cause he's not done with me yet. That was that. Well, I can. I'm not gonna play the whole 20 seconds of it.
No.
Well, because it doesn't do any justice because there's a slideshow of photos. You need to see the photo slideshow.
The slideshow. First off, slideshow moving too fast. Why is it of him and Gene Taylor hugging like they're in a couple?
That's what's saving K-State is Gene Taylor. Gene Taylor's been incredible, their athletic director.
Notice it wasn't of the university president.
Yeah, that would have been great. If the last photo was him high-fiving the school president, that would have been something. But yes, it was his own. It was not from the K-State Twitter account, hence the music choice and everything, I think. But that was from Jerome Tang's Twitter account.
I rate it like a 3.5. Look, I think for K-State fans, you should be happy. He's done a nice job. It is. But it also just means, like, you're going to have to do this every year, man. You, K-State with Tang, just as long as he keeps winning enough, and Leipold with Kansas every year. But both, what's crazy is, both could play their cards right over the next couple of years and just make those guys lifer because of age. Tang, career assistant under Scott Drew, 57 years old. Leipold's 59. If you play it well, there's a chance you could just make them lifers. People will always be attracted, like they are in the NFL, of the young upstart offensive coordinator for Georgia versus your guy. But, it, man, you have to dodge like 8 to 10, 12 teams calling your school over the next 3 or 4 years to try to avoid losing them.
You're going to have to keep the salaries competitive. You're also going to have to make sure you have a good relationship with the coach. And that's where the K-State thing is still interesting. He's got a great relationship with Gene Taylor. But the school president, is that something that also eventually, if another issue comes up with the school president impacting the athletic department in a way Jerome Tang maybe doesn't like, that's when you wonder if you
Calipari, he just left because of this. You know, it's like,
yeah, I mean, he
that was part of it, man.
He left him and the AD didn't, you know, there were some disagreements. The fan base couldn't stand the guy. And he was maybe going to get fired. Where Jerome Tang, the fan base loves Jerome Tang in K-State.
Yeah, like, they do.
They can't stand the school president. And he took him to an Elite Eight a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
a little different.
Fan base views him a lot differently. We could talk maybe in the 1 o'clock hour who could take the Kentucky job, because as you said, there's a trickle down effect. But Scott, you know, if Scott Drew takes Kentucky, then Baylor's open.
I think
that
Scott
impact?
Drew is my current leader in the clubhouse. Okay. I don't know why. It just seems like the perfect fit of not as big of a name as you'd want, but a national championship winning head coach who's accomplished everything he needs to accomplish at Baylor. Now he can go to see if he can do it at Kentucky.
Further down the list, Chris Beard is interesting.
Yeah, maybe.
He turned down the Arkansas job as well. But let's get to the random question today.
Random question.
For you, Gold. For you, Drew, over in the text line, 913-586-7610. First, somebody gave me an idea on the text line that I think makes sense. Can we do a Club 610 this summer from a pool? Poolside, Club 610?
Well, we've talked about doing some of that Oceans of Fun. We've tried. We've tried to do Worlds of Fun, Oceans of Fun. We've tried.
We can probably do that.
Yeah, remember we almost did it last year. Technical difficulties with that. But.
No, they changed the timing of the roller coaster opening. It wasn't even like we couldn't get connected from a show perspective. They changed the day the roller coaster opened when I went to go ride the Zambezi Zinger. For you three, and then we can figure out Club 610 by a pool later, is related to the eclipse. There are some people who think the eclipse, which has officially begun, by the way,
it's underway,
is going to lead to the end of the world. I'm not going to ask you whether or not you think the end of the world is coming today, because I think it's a pretty quick answer from the two of you, both level-headed people. The question I have for you is, let's say it is the end of the world. Fire and brimstone starts raining upon us, and we officially are living in a purge-type situation.
Oh.
How many hours or days do you think you live before it's over for you? Starting from right now. So 1:54, the eclipse happens, technology fails us all, and we are full blown in a purge situation. How many hours are you living before someone wipes you out? Days, weeks? How long you think you got?
A few weeks. I got a few weeks. Yeah, I think I got a few
things
weeks.
Start getting really bleak, like people start realizing that it's like a fully, because like the first day, most people are still going to try to be courteous, right? I don't think everyone's just going to go out murdering right away. It'll be kind of weird and people will be like fighting over food, but I'll just kind of stay on the outskirts of the, like, you know, raiding.
I think there's
such
a difference between, hey, suddenly the technology, you know, everything goes out and you're wondering what's going to happen. There's a difference between that and
the unknown for 48 hours.
Unknown for 48, I think you're fine. But if you just fly out, it became known and there was a bulletin that came across all the TVs and they just took over the TVs and the world was ending in 7 days. That's different. Like, if you know the world's ending in 7 days.
Or they can't explain it. Technology's failed us all. And they're not sure. Like, it's not like, hey, the world is ending. But it just seems like it. You know, everyone's stealing from grocery stores. Food production's down. I think I've got, like, a week. And then eventually, I'm going to try to step into a situation where somebody's taking, like, I'm going to try to, you know, like, get food, and that's already been taken care of. I got about a week to 10 days. Hmm. Like, I'm not in it for the long haul. I don't own a weapon. I have no weapons training. Like, so there's a certain amount of limit that I can survive anyway.
So you think you're going to get taken out at a grocery store? Is what you're saying?
Yeah, I think
Cody's going to be at the meat section. And
food related is always the way it goes.
Cody's going to be hanging out over actually a produce. He's going to be taking.
There's always a certain amount of food in the tap household, but eventually, you know.
I just think there's a difference between if you flat out know for sure, like you got a week left, versus something's going on.
It just
on.
Seems like if you've seen you've seen End of the World movies where they don't know the world's ending, but technology fails, and then it seems like things eventually turn for the worse. It's not like a Walking Dead situation, but you get the point. Mm-hmm. The eclipse makes things happen. So you think you're making it longer than a week?
I think so. I'm just staying inside.
But you don't have enough food in your place. You're going to have to venture.
Yeah.
Now, I will say, your place would be easier to protect than mine. Because one entrance, maybe two with the garage. I don't think, you know, I think people would be more looking to houses than apartments in the initial part of, you know, let's go pillage people's places. And you have no food. So you're going to have to go out. You might have, maybe occasionally, might have some string cheese or some water. But that's it.
Just roll.
Does your place have a bathtub? Could you fill it up with drinkable water?
It does have a bathtub.
Nice.
Yeah.
Have you ever sat in it?
No. I told you this. One, it is not, it just, when you're 6'3", and we're not talking about like a full-blown jacuzzi, we're just talking about a shower that happens to have, you know, a bath, you know, whatever. It's sure. Not comfortable for someone that's taller. It's just not.
Yeah, you're like half in the water.
It's not comfortable, yeah. And the water gets cold so quick, you know. No.
So it's not for you, huh?
I'll be out of my place as soon as you can snap your fingers.
Yeah, Drew can't wait for the apocalypse. He's just going to leave his apartment destitute and behind.
I would say I could go a few weeks. I'd be optimistic in saying a few months, I think.
I think you're too nice, man. Someone's going to be like, hey, Drew, hold on. Look, we've got some food over here in the van we want to share. Then you're kidnapped. It's over.
Oh, wow.
Well, no, that's
too trustworthy.
The fact that I'm nice, I think it actually plays into my, I can, if somebody's like, look, like I can make deals with people. Like, look, I'm at the grocery store. You want this last piece of meat? How about this? You can have it.
I don't think it's going down like that.
I also got bad news, man.
I think they're just taking it.
I got bad news.
Like, at least I can, like, build something or start a fire. Like, I have some life skills, but that's it.
So, like, on some of that, I'd be screwed. But the bad news I have for you, Drew, you just say you think you can barter. Is that what you said, basically?
Yes, he's saying, like, a general negotiation. I'll take the last box of cereal. You take the last meat.
Just a week ago, you told us you got scammed on Facebook Marketplace, giving you a couch. You gave a guy $100 for your couch.
Great, great question. What does your wife think is happening today with the moon?
Yeah, because she thinks the moon's fake. So what does she think is getting covered up? Just like the lens of a fake thing that's projecting the moon just happens to get covered up
today? The sun's blocked by the... She's not a flat earther.
She's not a flat earther.
What's the explanation?
Well, she said today was, today's the eclipse, right? I was like, yeah. She goes, okay. That's all she did. I don't...
You know what? You probably don't want to know more anyway. It's fine.
I don't know.
That's
she just
one
think
for
that somebody like somebody at NASA just is slowly moving a sheet of paper
satellite.
Over this fake move?
Fake moon.
Fake moon? Yeah.
Let me go ahead and text her right now and see what she says.
Okay.
What do you think about the eclipse?
Like you said, it is underway. We won't really leave it. What do they say? 50% around 1:14 or so. So we're 20 minutes away from 50% eclipse. And at 1:54, we'll get to 89-point-something%.
Yeah, it's just barely underway.
I think she
doesn't look any darker at the moment.
I think she believes in the eclipse. I mean, I
but
don't
how?
But what is eclipsing it?
If she thinks the moon is fake, then how can you believe in the eclipse?
Man, you know what? Honestly, have your own set. This is very deep. I need like explanations and all.
She thinks the moon is real, but the moon landing was fake. I think that's her premise.
Got it.
I thought
the moon wasn't a real thing.
I thought that's
thing.
What was established.
Like, if she thinks the moon landing is fake, there's a lot of people who believe in that. I don't, but plenty of people do.
She's a conspiracy person.
That's fine.
With some stuff. We'll have to see if she thinks
I think you've been saying for months.
She needs to come in for a Club 610 if you're willing to have her.
Days.
And I want to hear more of the theories. That's what I want. I want to hear more of the theories.
More conspiracy theories?
Yeah.
Sure.
Oh, believe me, she's got a sports one. She's got...
Oh.
Not necessarily...
Okay.
I don't know if they're like high-level conspiracy, but she's like, oh, yeah, the game's rigged for LeBron, for instance. Or, you know, she's one of those people.
They should have rigged it better. He didn't win enough for rigging it for him.
But it's rigged against Joe Burrow, right? That's what you guys think.
I've never said the game is rigged against. I've never said it's rigged against Joe Burrow.
Okay.
I will say, though, it is very unfortunate that he happened to have the worst offensive line in NFL history.
Well, that's...
And they forced that. They forced that to happen. Interesting.
Yeah, they did, and he still
Chiefs
took
also
them to the
Super Bowl. One of the worst offensive lines of all time. They lost the Super Bowl, then they won two more.
Yeah.
The good thing is the line's
crazy.
Not as
the
bad
NFL,
anymore.
They rigged it for one of the smallest markets in the NFL to have the biggest superstar.
She would get the text the line fired team. Up. She thinks that things are rigged for Patrick Mahomes.
Okay.
Probably are, which I don't care. Why should we care? It's great news on this end.
All right. I was going to say, yeah, it's
coming
good news
up
for
next,
you guys.
We enter the 1 o'clock hour. The eclipse is full go. And,
gotta go find glasses.
We do need to find glasses, and we'll talk about the first time Brett Veach did this as a general manager in the NFL.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
ESPN Bet is ready to take you through all the huge sports moments this spring. The exclusive sports book of ESPN has it all, including offers and promotions from Scott Van Pelt and Stephen A. Smith. There's no better time to be a sports fan. New users get $100 in bonus bets for making any sportsbook bet. Download ESPN Bet today. What a play. Must be 21 or older. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. In partnership with Hollywood Casino at Kansas Speedway. Terms and conditions apply. See app for details.
Our $79 garage door tune-up extended through April. Overhead Door Company of Kansas City will perform their 26-point maintenance tune-up and safety inspection for just $79, now extended through April. That's just $79 for up to 3 garage doors and openers. You need this done once a year, so why not now? And for just $79. Schedule now at overheaddoorkc.com.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. 120,000 miles of night drives, daily commutes, and who knows how many.
Are we there yet?
Through countless fixes, elbow grease, and a new radiator, you kept your ride alive. With eBay Motors, you have over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Is switching your wireless service to Total by Verizon easy?
Totalmente!
And you get unlimited 5G data? $25 a line for 4 lines on the unlimited plan? At an amazing price? With no contracts? Should you switch to Total by Verizon? Definitely!
Totalmente!
Find a store or switch suavemente at totalbyverizon.com. Monthly rate when you activate without a pay, plus taxes and fees. Discount begins the month after you enroll. Additional terms apply. See website for data management practices.
Hey, it's Gold again talking about DuraVision and a decision that I made almost 3 years ago. It was a decision that I was almost not willing to make. It was pretty simple. Do I pick up the phone and call DuraVision for a free consultation? I was worried, am I going to be told yet again that you're not a candidate for LASIK? Your eyes aren't going to work for this, because that was what I was told many, many, many years ago. But technology changes, your eyes change, and you simply got to call the best in Kansas City when it comes to your vision needs. That's what I did. DuraVision can be reached at 913-491-3330. And they told me, after taking all these images of my eye, that they could put a plan in place. And they showed me what that plan was. And a few days later, I underwent LASIK, and now I don't need contacts. I don't need glasses. It truly has been the best decision I have made. And you just have to find out if you're a candidate as well by giving them a call for that consultation at 913-491-3330 or go online to DuraVision.com and tell them Gold from 610 sent you.
QC Kinetics announces the arrival of National Medical Director Dr. Mitchell Scheinkopf, an acclaimed orthopedic surgeon with 2 decades of experience and extensive research in regenerative medicine.
I was one of the first orthopedic surgeons to do it, and at the same time, I integrated clinical research that's resulted in several publications that are really directing the future of regenerative medicine. I was drawn to QC Kinetics after I reviewed their protocols, and everything they were doing is consistent with my own approach.
Today, Dr. Scheinkup leads the entire team of medical professionals at QC Kinetics, taking this exciting medical breakthrough to a whole new level.
What we are doing at QC Kinetics is transforming lives.
Get lasting joint pain relief. Call QC Kinetics now for your free consultation.
This is the future of medicine.
Call QC Kinetics, 816-412-6299. That's 816-412-6299. 816-412-6299.
Hey, Kansas City, it's Brian Pringle with Victory Ford and KCK. Get ready for our hail sale at Victory Ford right here at the Legends in KCK. We're slashing prices on new crew cab 4x4 F-150 starting at just $39,988. That's right, hail savings of thousands of dollars on every vehicle. Visit VictoryFordKC.com to browse through hundreds of new and pre-owned vehicles with hail damage, all discounted thousands of dollars. Remember, at Victory Ford, our first price is better than their last. Victory Ford, where the deals are always legendary.
Spring is in the air, and that means one thing. Dandelions are coming. Don't let those annoying yellow weeds invade your lawn again. This year, trust your lawn to Ryan Lawn and Tree. This is Larry Ryan. No other lawn care company delivers the results that Ryan Lawn and Tree delivers. More than just providing a beautiful dandelion-free lawn, your trusted pros in the clean red trucks make sure your entire landscape is healthy, strong, and ready to look great no matter what nature throws at it. And unlike the other guys, the pros at Ryan Lawn and Tree are employee owners, full-time professionals going above and beyond every day with five-star customer service. Call us or click RyanLawn.com today. And as a new customer, you'll save 50% on your first lawn application. Enjoy a worry-free, effort-free, dandelion-free lawn this year with Ryan Lawn and Tree.
Are you someone who tries to drive while distracted by your phone? Someone who props it on the steering wheel or peeks down at it for a glance? Or just scrolls and scrolls? If so, you could be the next person to get into a fender bender, get a ticket, veer off the road, or even cause a crash that kills you or someone else. Enough already. Put the phone away or pay. Paid for by NHTSA.
The good folks at Wendy's have a revolutionary new product for you. Introducing the new Orange Dreamsicle Frosty. It's like a time machine that takes you all the way back to now, the year 2024. It's the classic, creamy, orangey flavor you remember. Dare I say, it's new timey. It's the flavor you grew up with, just all grown up. Head over to your local Wendy's establishment and get yours while supplies last. The new Orange Dreamsicle Frosty. Here for the now, for now.
Limited time only at participating Wendy's.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios.
Kansas City. This is Royals manager Matt Quatrero. Catch Vern's On Deck show 1 hour before first pitch on your home for Royals baseball, 610 Sports Radio, and the Odyssey app.
KCSP Kansas City, WDAF HD2 Liberty, always live on the free Odyssey app.
Till the sky went black, and
there was no the Eclipse playlist. I like it. I like it. Why not? Why not have some fun with it? We're 45 minutes or so away from it actually being really noticeable, the eclipse, that is. And now the text line is enjoying. They're happy we finally said, I've been waiting all day for you guys to ask Drew the question about the moon and his wife.
We got an answer from his wife.
Yeah, we did.
She just ignores it.
There was a segment on the show, I don't know, 5 months ago?
It was a while ago, yeah.
You know, something like that. Maybe like the first month or two you were on the show.
Something like that, yeah.
And I believe at that point in time you said your wife thinks the moon is fake. Right?
It is indeed that. We found out.
Uh-huh. Hmm. And so we were trying to figure out today, and listeners there were like, they were wondering the same thing all day. What do people that think the moon is fake, what do they think is going on today? What do they actually think is occurring? And
she said she ignores it.
She just ignores it. She didn't have an explanation, they just ignore it.
She didn't pay any mind to it.
Dark spot of the sun. Who knows, man? By the way, could you imagine if you go through all this? Like, we don't have any solar eclipse glasses. We forgot them.
Yeah, there's none downstairs.
We will not be looking up at the sun because I'd like to retain my vision.
Yeah, dirty vision can't even help me if that happens, I don't think.
No, you're screwed.
And they're the best.
But like I just saw like there's like 10 urgent news alerts from a brand that got recalled in Illinois.
Okay.
And it's like, could you imagine if you bought these solar eclipse glasses, you're like, sweet, get a look up at the sun. You look up at this damn thing and you go blind anyway?
Oh, that sounds like a lawsuit waiting to happen.
Well, I mean, I assume so, because how am I supposed to, like, an hour before the eclipse happens, then you warn me of a recall? I have to on social media.
Help the people.
Biniki, B-I-N-I-K-I, is the brand name. They have an urgent recall. They were sold mostly in Illinois.
They waited until, like you said, they wait until the day of?
Dude, literally like 45 minutes ago.
They were sold start testing
six
them out.
Packs. They don't have the right ISO. They don't have the right ISO rating, so like they can't block the sun the way they claim they do. They're also available on Amazon, so be very careful about using those. If you have the brand BIKINI, I would not put those on, or I would, you know, don't look at the sun if you do put them on. That's all. Yeah, that, I assume that would be like it's too late. It'd be like this is like a recall if I was like driving on a highway and like, hey, Cody, I'm not looking at my phone. We have recalled Cody's car because now the wheels just come off. It's crazy. Like, well, I got to know that before I'm in the damn car. Doesn't do me any good. So, yep, there's a recall for if you bought Beniki. I hope we say some nice today. I hope one person in the text is like, damn. That's the kind I bought off of Amazon.
You said
that
they were mainly only sold in Illinois, though.
The large majority of them were sold in Illinois, but somebody did show them as a purchase on Amazon.
I just saw the CBS article, news article on that.
Yeah, so just be warned.
I mean, okay.
So, good times. You know, we're going to have Brie, like you said, we'll have to get her into Club 610 one time, and I'd like to break down all conspiracy theories with her.
I want to talk some Chiefs football for a little bit because after we got off the show Friday, the Chiefs continued to bring back virtually the same defensive front, which is a good thing, in my opinion, based off of what they were able to do.
I mean, been top five in sacks 2 years in a row.
Mike Dana on a 3-year deal, 24 mil, 13 million guaranteed. Guy had 6.5 sacks. This kind of completes where one of the questions people had with Brett Veach, I think, was, all right, How long are you going to go without re-signing anybody you drafted? And this is the first time. Mike Dana is the first player that Brett Veach has drafted that they actually re-signed, which is pretty wild to think about.
Did Clyde not count first?
No, they didn't. No. I don't think that counts. I don't believe
he's
that.
He's just a true free agent who couldn't do it? Sure. But, I mean, I get it. Like, or at least to a multi-year contract.
That's what I mean. Sorry. Multi-year.
Because technically you re-signed Clyde for 1 year. Or he's re-signed one place for 1 year here or there. But, look, that also just means that he only started drafting. Like, he's just getting to the beginning of his re-signability for a lot of these players. Because when you're a GM for 4, 5, 6 years, you have to get 4, 5, 6 years in to start signing the players that you wanted to draft to bring back. Dana is a perfect fit. He is more valuable to the Chiefs than almost any other team. And they still didn't overpay him. $8 million a year for a 5-sack guy is a good price. It is a fair market value for Mike Dana, a guy who has been consistently in your line, is available for the most part, and has been a part of multiple world championships and an effective member of those teams. Dana, you know what I like about him? He is the best defensive line safety net, where if he has to play more than you want, it's not gonna be a disaster. It won't be as good as playing George Karloftis or other defensive linemen all the time, but he's not going to screw things up for you. I think that's what makes Dana fit so well.
Well, it's a multi-year deal, but also for this particular season, Charles Amenihue's injury, we don't know exactly when he's available. It could be October. It could be November when he's back from the ACL. And then what level is he playing at? So you needed somebody else that has a proven track record of getting, you know, 5.5, 6 sacks last year, 6.5 sacks. For the Chiefs. And so I think that's why it's nice. And because he went out and tested free agency, maybe the market wasn't what everybody thought. You know, I think expectation at one point he was going to get what Emmanuel Ogba got a couple years ago, 3 for $30 or something like that.
Yeah.
He did not.
I thought he might get more.
He got less than that. And so it's a really nice contract for both parties. And someone on the text line said, yeah, like, doesn't this mean that Brett Veach has been hitting on a lot of draft picks? Sure. But it's still notable that the first guy that they signed to a multi-year deal that was drafted and retained is Mike Dana. And yeah, they're going to, some of it is because they financially aren't able to retain everybody. Like L'Jarius Sneed was good enough to get another contract and he was drafted.
He got $50 million guaranteed for someone else.
So it's not like, oh man, there's just nobody they would have wanted to give contracts to, but it's just, it's the first time. that they thought it was worthwhile to retain somebody. Now they're going to have a couple more, I think, very soon. You know, Creed Humphrey will be the second player, maybe, or Nick Bolton, maybe Trey Smith. But I think two of the three, not all three, are going to get extensions at some point. Most likely it's Creed and Bolton, or at least Creed. So that would be another player that gets it. But it is nice when you look at how good the defense was to feel, I think, a lot better heading into August without even drafting anybody yet. And they still might draft a defensive tackle. At one point, the mock that Drew mentioned earlier today.
Second round, Mike Hall, who's visiting the Chiefs today, actually, according to his own Instagram
page. He's one of the top 30 visits or whatever they call it. Huh? So,
okay. Did you see the WrestleMania stuff with Trey Smith this weekend? So we knew the story at the time with the parade. Yeah, we saw the story at the time of the parade shooting, and we knew that Trey Smith had comforted a child with his WWE belt and then focusing on that. I didn't know that was Mike Borganti's kid. Did anybody realize that until this weekend?
No, I don't think that was known.
Okay, yeah, I was like, if I missed that, I'm sorry. The assistant general manager's kid is who Trey Smith was comforting at the time of that shooting, and I had not seen that. They were all out there at WrestleMania. It was very cool.
Yeah, WrestleMania was in Philly. Jason Kelce had a cameo, and yeah, Trey Smith and Creed Humphrey were all hanging out there, but ESPN, or not ESPN, but whoever the pay-per-view for WrestleMania ended up putting together a
Peacock
piece.
Is that who has it now?
You might have, I think, because Rinaldi did it, and Rinaldi's with Fox now, right?
Yeah, it could have been. I think they've been on Fox.
Okay, yeah, because
WrestleMania has been.
That's right. Okay, so yeah, not pay-per-view, sorry. Yeah, Rinaldi works for Fox now. Of course, used to be with ESPN, and Rinaldi's like the best at doing pieces like this. And yeah, one of the pieces they had was the interview with Trey Smith. And yeah, it turns out Mike Borganti's son and his wife, and they very emotional, obviously, and still an amazing thing that Trey Smith was able to step up and do in that moment and comfort somebody. So yeah, those are more details I don't think we knew. You're right, at the time. So if you haven't seen, I retweeted it. I think it was PJ Green over at Fox 4 put out the clip on Friday or Saturday, and I don't know if Cody, you might have retweeted it too. It's on my timeline, but PJ Green put it out. If you go on X, you can see the video that we're talking about.
It's very cool. Very cool moment. You mentioned Trey Smith and an extension. It made me think of that story from this weekend, which I thought was kind of incredible. So yeah, I mean, back to Dana for just a minute. The only other thing, and I think we can talk about this more in the year, is bringing back the entire defensive line on a defensive line that we called too deep for Felix and Udike Uzama to play. Does it mean they're not going to play him again?
Well, Aminihue is out.
Too deep, yeah, fair, but Aminihue missed the first six games last year, and Felix played a little bit more.
He didn't.
While he was gone. So Aminihue comes back and Felix goes right back to the bench?
Well, depends
on this is the identical setup as last year. So in which way does Felix get more time, I guess?
If he gets better. I mean, I'm not. So this is where we always disagree on this. So I'm not telling you that Felix is going to be great. But I feel like you're already setting him up like that. This is who he is. And I'm just telling you, let's see how it plays out during camp. It probably is like the number one story when we get up to St. Joe. Like what is Felix and Udike Uzama's role, and did he improve? Like, did the year in an NFL system help him, or is he still the same guy? Because if he is still getting very little snaps this year, when that happens, then to me, that is when it's a fair conversation to be had about, okay, is he just never going to figure it out? Where I have taken issue is people have already made up their mind that he is not going to be a successful NFL player, and I think that is extremely unfair already. That's all I've been with this whole situation.
But you know that I don't stand that he has no chance. I'm just saying this does say something about their confidence of the chance of that happening.
I guess that's where
the playing time is the same, how
let's see if it is. I'm just saying, like, we're already assuming it's going to be like
sure,
that's
but
where
if you
I'm
pay
taking
$8 million
issue.
A year for Mike Dana, I think you were saying that there's a better chance that Mike Dana gets more playing. You know what I'm saying?
Well, there might be, but let's see if that happens before we're already saying, like, well, he's just going to be it's the same situation as last year, so there's just no way he's going to break through. Let's see what happens during camp.
But some of this is prognosticating in the sense that I would if they bring in a free agent tackle to compete with Wanye. Like, I think that they are telling you either they're really planning on challenging.
But Wanye wasn't a first round pick. You know what I mean? Like, it's just a little bit different. And that's why we talk about Felix differently, because there are expectations fairly when you're a first round pick. Let's see what this year brings. I mean, if this particular season he goes through and he's only playing 20%, you know, even if he's only playing like 20% of the snap, well, then it's a problem. You know, then that was not a good pick. I just don't think we can already declare we know exactly what his career path is going to look like. That's all.
Texan was correct, by the way. They're saying it was on Peacock for WrestleMania, which was my guess. I thought they just owned all the rights to the big wrestling events, but.
So if you kept Peacock from the wild
card
game
or
whatever.
Well, if you're a big wrestling fan, you probably have Peacock anyway.
Yeah. What I thought one of them switched to Netflix, or was that who I thought one? I don't know. I don't know enough about wrestling, but I thought one of them got a deal with Netflix, and all their crap is on Netflix. You know, I can't remember. I don't know what's what. Anyway, I don't follow wrestling so much. I know WrestleMania is a huge deal to a lot of people. I just don't know the ins and outs of that. And I saw the clip of the cameo.
Netflix is about to smell what WWE Raw.
Okay,
appears.
There you go.
Is cooking.
I knew there was something with. I knew there was something with Netflix.
Okay,
there you go.
So,
how about that?
But I think for some of the other live events, they've done it differently. No, look.
Did you watch? Are you a wrestling guy?
No, I just saw some of the headline stuff. So I got invited over to a friend's house to do it, but like we had other things we had to do, so I didn't have time on Saturday or Sunday to do it. But I've watched a WrestleMania. I mean, it's fun. It's a good time.
It's obviously very, very popular.
The thing I run into a problem is I feel like I'm the annoying person to go to the movie with because wrestling. So like, for instance, I understand that this storyline between Cody Rhodes and Roman Reigns, right, is years in the making. The storyline of what happened on Sunday is like 2 years worth of a congruence of events to lead to this moment. And that John Cena and The Rock and The Undertaker, like all this stuff is like 10, like decades worth of stuff that I don't understand.
Mm.
So then all of a sudden I become the guy who's sitting next to you at the WrestleMania party and be like, I'm going to need a breakdown of all of this because this moment of drama is built up more for the people who are connected to it forever. Right. And I don't know. You know, I don't know enough.
Yeah. Well, I totally, it's just anytime there's a celebrity or NFL player that makes a cameo, I see it come across the timeline. I'm like, oh, that's interesting. Jason Kelce threw a guy into the ring. That's cool. Glad in Philadelphia. And he stood up on the ropes.
That seemed fun.
Why not? But yeah, I've just never.
Lane Johnson.
And I know it's worth, you know, WWE or whatever is worth billions of dollars and fans love it. It's something I just never really got into. When I was like little, I watched like, you know, SmackDown, I don't know, randomly, and that was it. But I haven't kept up, and it's not something I'm overly
into. Like my general theory on this is, do not tell people the things they can't enjoy. Like if you're like, wrestling's lame. Yeah. That's not any good. Like earlier this morning,
you can say it's lame, but there's obviously a ton of people that love it.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, why knock down somebody else's enjoyment?
It's no different than me saying that I like Breaking Bad and you saying that show sucks. It's no different.
But I just don't need to like bring somebody else's like we were talking this morning. There was a story that Morgan Wallen like threw a chair off of a Nashville
got
arrested and charged with it. And I saw like Gold mentioned that and I was like, huh. And then I saw a photo of Morgan Wallen. I said, that's what Morgan Wallen looks like. And you're like, hey, he's very popular. I'm like, oh, I'm not denying that. And I don't care. Like, cool that people like his music. I was like, I just don't listen to it. So I didn't know what Morgan Wallen looked like. I just don't.
Yeah.
But like, I also understand people like country. Doesn't have to be for, like, wrestling doesn't have to be for me or.
For sure.
But like, I don't know if it stinks. I don't watch it enough to make any declarative statements about it. I'm sure it's fine.
I don't even know how we got to this point at all.
Trey Smith stuff at least got us part of the way there.
Mm-hmm.
So, right?
Yeah. Is it just me, or is it actually a little hazier outside, or a little slightly darker? This is when it was supposed to be 50%, Cody. 119, 114, or whatever.
Does it? It looks slightly darker.
Because I'm like, suddenly I don't have sunglasses on, and it looks a little.
Did you have sunglasses on before?
No, meaning that it's not as bright outside. Right now it's supposed to be 50%, and we don't have the sun in front of us.
Like, look at this. If you're an adult that's really into wrestling, I don't think you should be able to allow to operate a motor vehicle. Okay,
sir, well, that's.
And you've probably been playing fantasy football for the last, like, 20 years of your life, and now you're going to knock somebody else's interest where things are like, what do you not like movies? Like, I don't like the Fast and the Furious. They don't really jump cars into planes like that. Entertainment doesn't have to be real. I love live sports for the actual live drama.
For sure.
It's all built up.
I don't know. I've looked outside a couple of times, and it looks.
It's definitely darker. 100%.
Yeah, I think 50% of it is covered. It being the sun.
You call it a black hole sun.
Black hole sun. Won't you come?
Corniest thing we've done on the show. Think about corny things we've done on the show? Black hole sun. That's corny.
It's the Eclipse playlist, you know?
But it's cool. But it's
we
cool.
Just got done talking about wrestling, and we just got done saying don't make fun of people, and then here we are. Here we are.
Here we are. Just said it's corny.
I'm capping it off. I'm capping the moment off the last couple of minutes.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's not really until 154 anyway, you know?
I'll just play a couple of songs from the playlist, and maybe as it's.
Mm-hmm. Cody likes when you do that.
We're not going to close with Brandy today. We're going to close with.
Well, I don't know about that.
Something else.
I don't know about that.
Okay.
The sun will be up by then, you know? Practically done.
Someone says it for sure has started here. My favorite is the disputing, the conflicting text. Someone says, oh, it's for sure started. Someone else says, it's just as bright as it was 45 minutes ago. There's no way it is. It's absolutely
darker than it was.
I can tell based on the, you could probably see it from the video.
I can tell based on the stream because you can see gold better.
Yeah, it's.
Because our lighting in here stinks.
Yeah, it's definitely a little darker outside.
That's all. Okay. Anyway,
people
I don't know.
Giving Drew song suggestions. Yes. Mm. Perfect. Mm. Fade to Black.
Is that going to be our What's Trending song?
That's a little less on the nose, mm-hmm. which I appreciate. Fade to What's Trending. It's a little bit distracting, at least on that end. Maybe we ought to go to a wrestling event one of the, you know, the next time. The next one's in KC. Gold, me and you.
They would have to be free tickets.
I'm sure we can get some free tickets.
And that's not even me saying it because I generally, and we just had the conversation.
It's just not my thing.
It's so just not my thing. It's like,
Have you watched a wrestling event?
I've gone to one event. It was at the Time Sprint Center, and I'll be honest, it
didn't move the needle for you.
No.
How long is the event, like in total? How long?
I don't know.
Are you? Is it like a normal sporting event?
I left early.
Yeah, some of them are hours. Sure. Most of them are hours, just like a boxing match or whatever. There's lots of different fights.
A lot of my friends from like just growing up loved WWE and WrestleMania and all that stuff.
I still have a good group of friends that love it. I've watched 10, like 20, I don't know, bigger wrestling events. Because like I had friends who were in there, I'm like, sure, whatever. It's like if you invited me over Gold for if you were you're a huge Love Is Blind fan. Like, hey, man, we're going to watch the finale together. Like, all right. You have to explain all this stuff to me.
I haven't watched the last five seasons.
It doesn't matter. I'm just saying, like, you know, like, if you got friends that are into stuff sometimes, I still go support it. It's fine. I'm not here to knock this as we slowly creep into the darkness.
Thanks. Is that where you were waiting for?
Are we going to send Drew outside?
For some music? For some music for that? Coming up next, we'll get to What's Trending. We'll get back into the Royals, the start of the season that they are off to, and also what in particular Travis Kelce's 2024 season could look like.
Hey, it's Vinny Pasquantino.
Don't forget to follow Cody and Gold on the Odyssey app so you can listen on demand to my terrific football takes throughout the year right here on 610 Sports Radio.
Brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
When you're getting ready to buy or sell a home, you want a real estate agent you can trust, and that agent is Dawn Sharp and the Sharp Homes team. Dawn and her team are on the cutting edge of all the latest and greatest ideas in the real estate industry today. That's why if I had to sell my home, Dawn Sharp and the Sharp Homes team are the only agents I would trust. But don't just take my word for it. They have over 100 five-star reviews on Google and sold 120 homes last year alone. So Google Sharp Homes team or check them out at homesforsaleinkc.com.
Erectile dysfunction affects many men in America today, but it's not just the man who's affected. It's also often their partner. But successful treatment of ED can truly bring relationships back to life. This is Jeff, the CEO of Promenic Restorative Men's Health, and that's why I'm pleased to announce the opening of our second location of Heartland Men's Health right here in Independence, Missouri. As a Promenic affiliate, Heartland Men's Health is a part of a group that has successfully treated tens of thousands of men over the last decade with treatments that are shown in medical studies to be effective in well over 90% of men. And unlike wave therapy groups or online pill sellers, we offer a variety of treatments to help you get the results you want. You could even find you're performing like you haven't in years. So call Heartland Men's Health today. Your initial visit is only $99 and includes a medical consult, blood work, and if medically advised, a test dose. And if that test dose doesn't work in the office, your visit is free. Call 844-447-6600 or go to heartlandmenshealth.com. That's heartlandmenshealth.com.
The Landing in Liberty, the largest sports bar north of the river, and the home of over 65 HD TVs with every sports package. Hey, our motto is any game, anytime. 10,000 square feet under one roof to provide adequate social distancing. Our non-smoking patio is not covered, but in the winter, it's home of the only dine-in heated igloos in the Northland. Each igloo has its own TV and sound system and seats up to 8 people. The Landing has a great menu featuring the best dry rub wings in Kansas City and the home of the Ben Maller Chicken Fingers. Most of our menu items, dressing, and wing sauces are house-made. daily food specials, happy hour every day from 3 till 7 p.m. Live music on our smoking patio Thursday through Sunday nights. Make your next destination the Landing in Liberty. Food, fun, music, and sports. The Landing in Liberty, 1189 West Kansas Street in Liberty. Check us out online at thelandingeateryandpub.com. We'll see you at the Landing.
Hey, it's Kling. There are many reasons I love Hy-Vee. The great values, the selection, the service, and I love to rack up fuel savers. And you can as well. Shop Hy-Vee on Monday, earn a fuel discount equal to the high temperature on Sunday and the amount you spend. If the high is 68 degrees on Sunday, I'll save 68 cents per gallon when I spend $68 on Monday. Heat up the savings every Monday through April 29th only at Hy-Vee.
Must look up code 80007 at checkout or promo code HEATUP when shopping online. See store for details.
The best deals at the pump happen when you shop the aisles of Hy-Vee with help from the First Warm 5 weather team.
This is KCTV 5 chief meteorologist Luke Doris. Watch KCTV 5 Sunday night at 10 for our official high temperature.
Whatever it was on Sunday means you save on Monday with your Hy-Vee Perks card. If the high was 63 degrees, you save 63 cents a gallon when you spend at least $63.
Watch First Warm 5 weather on KCTV 5 this Sunday at 10.
It's Rawhide Harley's pre-owned spring clearance sale this week. Hundreds of Harleys tagged with liquidation pricing. Save $2, $4, even $6,000 at Rawhide Harley's spring clearance sale. Good credit, bad credit, or no credit? Psh, no problem. Rawhide Harley is considering 100% of all credit applications. The owner says 50 used bikes must go this week because we need to make room for the new 2024s. You don't need perfect credit, don't need a cash down payment. Rawhide Harley-Davidson is part of the number one volume Harley dealer group in the Midwest. Pre-owned spring clearance sale ends this Sunday. On approved credit.
Syntec Premium Full Synthetic Motor Oil is formulated for today's engines. Available only at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Are you the parent of a 2 to 7-year-old? Listen closely for an exciting free radio offer. By now, you've probably heard of ABC Mouse, the Parents' Choice Award-winning online learning program that's actually changing the lives of early learners everywhere.
ABC Mouse is like a little one-on-one teacher. It has helped her so much.
Right now, we're offering a special radio promo to try it free for a month. But you have to go to abcmouse.com/radio to claim your free month. That's abcmouse.com/radio.
Sponsored by Age of Learning.
Syntec Premium Full Synthetic Motor Oil is formulated for today's engines. Available only at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Timmy, everybody. Great job. Next up, we have Samantha.
10 times better performance can make a big difference. Castrol Edge Motor Oil gives your engine 10 times better high temperature performance. Castrol Edge, better oil for maximum performance. Now through April 23rd, get a $15 gift card when you buy 5 or more quarts of Edge or Edge High Mileage Full Synthetic, only at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Claim based on Sequence 3 H-Test versus API SP test limits.
Every business faces challenges, but complicated, expensive, and uncertain shipping shouldn't be one of them.
With USPS Ground Advantage from the United States Postal Service, you can avoid all the noise.
No more unexpected surcharges, hidden fees, or complex rate structures.
It's just easy, cost-effective, and dependable shipping. Tune your business's frequency to success and turn shipping to your advantage. Learn how at usps.com/advantage. USPS Ground Advantage. Simple, affordable, reliable.
Pros save big every day when you buy in bulk at Lowe's. Save 10% when you buy 68 or more select OSB sheathing. Plus, save an extra 5% every day on eligible purchases when you use your Lowe's business credit card. Visit us for the materials you need. Lowe's knows savings. Lowe's knows pros. Selection varies by location. While supplies last. Discount taken at time of purchase. See sales associate for details. 5% offer subject to credit approval. Exclusions and terms apply. See store Lowe's.com/credit for details. U.S. only.
What's trending?
All right, let's check in on the hot topics
trending. Number one on what's trending. We'll talk more about the Royals after this, but of course it is that the Royals have won 4 in a row, and they have opened up the season 2 games above 500. They're off today, and then they begin a 3-game set with the Houston Astros at Kauffman Stadium right here on 610 Sports Radio. We'll talk more about MJ Melendez and the clutch at-bats and the start of the season for him. But it's nice to have some positive things in the month of April for the first time in a while with this Royals team.
Yeah, I'm not going to complain, obviously. I think it's a big deal that they're performing as well as they are. And yeah, MJ Melinda has been a big part of that. Next up on What's Trending, national championship game tonight, 8:20, UConn versus Purdue. Let's be honest, these are the two best teams in men's college basketball the entire year. Got a good, really good first half out of South Carolina and Iowa on the women's side. Second half went all South Carolina's way. Hope for a good national championship game tonight. Start at 8:20 p.m. I don't like they're putting the women's championship game at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
That was dumb too.
The men one, they're starting at 8:20 p.m. I just don't understand what these sports leagues are doing. They must have people who tell them that this is the right choice or they wouldn't keep doing it. I think it's idiotic for most viewers. 8:20 Central.
Yeah.
Central time.
It sucks. I'm guessing they want, okay, they get East Coast is in prime time. They get Central prime time, Mountain prime time, and then West Coast is after 6 o'clock as well. I'm guessing that's their thought process. But yeah, this has been going on for over a decade now with that. But I am excited for the game tonight. Next, I'm going to watch trending college basketball. Huge news. It's not 100% done yet, but expectation is that John Calipari will go to Arkansas.
Wild.
And leave Kentucky, going to sign a multi-year deal there. Also expected to have one of the largest NIL budgets in the country as the boosters are going to step up now that they have Cal as their head coach. For Kentucky, that's the mystery, is where do they go? You know they're going to at least call the agent of Dan Hurley. He can say no, but you know they're at least going to try. And then you get to guys like Nate Oates or Scott Drew, but a massive shift in college basketball. For Kentucky and for Arkansas, who is a big winner here.
Yeah, I mean, look, Arkansas's got to feel king of the world. They lost Musselman, a coach that they liked and had done a really nice job in their program, and then seemingly were just like kicking around like the normal names you'd kick around if you're Arkansas that are around, like guys like Jerome Tang, right? Okay, like maybe the same level. And also they get Coach Cal, guy who's won a national championship, and convinced him to leave Kentucky. Money, man. Money talks. There's always a number.
Sure.
If somebody ever tells you, hey, what's the number for you, quit your job? I never. There's a number. There's always a number. And, they, you know, Cal probably just proved that.
Yeah, thinking of money, none of us won the Powerball.
No,
was it somebody in Oregon. Yeah, okay. Somebody in Oregon won.
I actually haven't checked my ticket. I don't even know if I got like a dollar or anything. $2 or whatever.
Check
it. It's in the car still.
Check it. Yeah, let us know. No, I didn't get a single number.
Did anybody in Missouri or Kansas win $1 million?
No, I looked. No.
Damn.
Nobody won even the match five or whatever.
Okay.
No, nothing.
So at best, it's like a few bucks.
And now it's only cash value like $9 million. It's just not
worthless.
Worth it. It's just not worth it. No.
Worthless.
That's what's trending. You're on Cody and Gold.
The real question is, if I won a cash value of $9 million, would I quit my job?
No, I don't think you would. I don't think you would, man.
That's close.
Cash value is nine.
I'm just gonna be honest.
Cash value is nine, taxes. So it's like $4.5 million. You're not quitting your job. Now you're comfortable. You should have no worries or anything like that. But you're not. I don't think you're quitting your job. In today's day and age, it's not as much. Like, I don't think you can quit your job.
$3 million in an interest bearing account.
No. Now
you don't think I
can
just
early.
Live off of the dividends?
I think you could retire early. Like, you don't have to work till you're 65 once you.
I'm
have
definitely
that.
Not working
until
65.
I don't think
that's
you're just
out.
I don't know if you're just quitting your job.
If you had 15, does that push you over?
I think it's got to be over 20
mil. $15 million right now, tax free. I quit. I'll leave. I'll never work again. I promise.
Tax free?
Again.
Yeah. If it's actually 15 mil, then yeah. I think you're probably.
I think if it's actually nine, you're probably out. But because it's four and a half, I'm probably going to work for, I don't know, 10 more years. Tops.
What's your answer, Drew?
I would say, okay, so 4.5.
Yeah.
Look, I said I would, if I won the Powerball, I'd keep working. So
the
answer
just a lie,
is keep
working. Like, you say that, but you're just lying to yourself. Scott Park's trying to tell me the same thing. It's just a lie.
No,
if all of a sudden you couldn't, by the way, you couldn't safely come to work. Once everyone figured out Drew had won $1 billion,
no.
You couldn't even come to. What are you going to do? You're going to come in here and you're going to produce a couple of idiots like us and have what? An 8-person security team taking you to
people
and from work?
Be
that's
waiting
just,
in the
there's just no way
people
to live.
Be waiting in the parking lot for
your
you.
Your family lives that's, in another state.
Drew, there would be somebody that has an emotional story every day after the show. It'd be waiting in the parking lot like, please, Drew, just a couple $100s. Every day you'd have somebody waiting for you. It would be awful.
Yeah. I would have to.
You'd have to quit.
Someone says $1 million, they'll quit their job, retire. For
I think you could still. I could still work. But it would have to be. It would be in a different capacity. Like, for example, you have that much money, I can create whatever I want and still feel like, you know, create a business or whatever, and still feel like
then
that.
You're working still.
That well, yeah, I know, like, I know, but it's I can do it. I don't have to go anywhere necessarily. You know, I can be in the comfort of. I can get that
based on. But just like the four and a half
can
million.
Be, you know, the itch can be scratched, I guess.
If someone
way.
Wants to give me $4.5 million, I'll quit. I can earn off of, I can earn $120,000 a year just off the interest and still have millions of dollars. I'll be fine. Just like, you know, If that was the requirement, I'd still work if I, you know, got $4 million.
I think you work another 5 to 10 years and then you're out. Yeah. Get another 5 or 10 and then you just put like, and then you're that money
just,
is just
let that money grow and grow and grow. And then,
by the way, it's,
I will say,
18 minutes, guys. 18 minutes.
Does it look any darker than
90% almost?
I don't know.
It's a little bit.
If you're curious, on YouTube, Twitter, Twitch, and Facebook, I guess you can see Gold slowly come into focus. Normally, we close these blinds that are behind him because it turns out backlighting is bad for seeing Gold's face. But you'll come more clear into the picture every second that this goes down.
154 is already at 90% of the eclipse. We won't get the full eclipse for where we are in the country. Let's talk about the Royals some more, though, because, yes, the team itself is off to a great start, but in particular, MJ Melendez is coming up with timely at-bats and looks way more confident at the plate. He talked about confidence in the clubhouse yesterday. He's the first player in Royals history to drive in the game-winning run in the seventh inning or later in three straight games. So you're getting timely hits.
Clutch hits.
Some power, too. It was a two-run home run yesterday, the go-ahead home run. Against the Chicago White Sox. And he was, and I know Vern mentioned this as well, he is one of, I don't know, 2-3 players that if he's able to take a leap forward in his career this year, that's how you start talking yourself into it being a way more competitive season, and that we're here in August or September and they're right there in the thick of things of the AL Central, that you're getting great starting pitching already. That's been unreal. But if guys like MJ Melendez, who are a little further down in the order, are going to take a huge leap, especially if the power's there,
means they're five deep in the lineup,
then all of a sudden you can work with that. You can really talk yourself into this team mid-August being right there in the Central if that happens.
Or in 2025, too, where, look, I think we're in the middle of seeing it. I like to think, and look, sometimes we're all wrong. So, you know what? Call me out if you're like, Cody, you're jinxing him or whatever else when we get 80 games from here. We are at the beginning of the MJ Melendez breakout season, as far as I'm concerned. This is it. I've seen it enough players over the course of years, and even just in Kansas City, when it finally clicked for Mike Moustakas or others. And look, Brady Singer, maybe you could be making that argument too, but I want to wait. I've seen some really good stretches from Brady. I know he's got a 0.68 ERA, but it just looks like MJ found it. And what's important, I think, for these breakout seasons, and when they're easier to predict, is when you are already that talented. The reason why I had some hesitation, let's say for Michael Garcia, who's had a great start to the season. Michael Garcia was always just kind of a dude in the minors, right? Good player, nice player, got to the major leagues at a young age. Good player, there's no doubt about that. But he was never like the guy at any particular level to the point that you thought, oh, here it is. MJ Melendez has led the minor leagues in home run. He has been a great hitter or a really good hitter at every single level of his entire life. He was always thought of as a top 5 prospect in the Royals organization, a top 50 prospect in all of baseball. And for the first couple of years, it didn't quite look that way because he couldn't get on base. He struck out too much. The power numbers weren't there. This is what it looks like when a high-level prospect finds it. That's what it looks like to me with NJ. I think we're just at the beginning of seeing his breakout season. I don't need to wait and see. I think it's there. But I also understand that, you know, like, people are wrong before. But the key is, like you mentioned, if you get MJ and Vinny and Bobby and Michael and just Salvi stays where he is, I mean, all of a sudden, top 5 of your lineup is young for the most part, except for Salvi, and very good.
No, there's plenty of reasons to be optimistic and not just the, okay, you know, that we've seen a 2-week stretch before, or a week and a half stretch before. You said it. You go through and you look at the age and also who the players are. I mean, Bobby Wood Jr., this isn't nobody's worried about that being fluky. He's the real deal. This is who he is. MJ, I do want to see a couple more weeks, though. I'm not saying he has to come up with every clutch hit, but I think it's fair to see.
I just like the way he's swinging in general. The clutch stuff, he's coming up at the right time and he's going. But yeah, the confidence is big, dude.
He's extremely confident. Yeah, he's extremely confident right now. And remember, the second half last year, he finished the season very strong. So it's nice to see him pick up right where he left off last year.
I thought they should have sent him down in June. I was wrong. Yeah. I thought they should have sent. We had this conversation, Gold. You said, give him one more week after the All-Star break, and then we can have that conversation. I said, look, I'd do it now, but okay, let's give him a week. Guy took his week, ran with it for the final 3 months, and absolutely raked, and has just carried that over perfectly into the start of this season.
And let's see where the bullpen goes from here. Here's the good news. If this team actually is in it, and it's near the trade deadline, we're getting way ahead of ourselves, but if it is, you can acquire bullpen. Like if they're actually in that position, sure. And I would love for FT to be able to have that conversation because
they just acquired a bullpen.
They did. Yeah, that's in the minors. But yeah, I hear you. So
like,
we'll
and I also see like, hey, MJ needs to be batting third. Move Vinny down to fourth. Like, what difference do you think that makes?
Too early for that. Let's see
it's
what
10 games. I'm not like moving the whole order over 10 games.
Quick 2-day reset. You know, he was out of the lineup yesterday. Vinny was because they're facing a lefty, but also today's an off day. So, okay, 2 days, reset here a little bit, take a deep breath, get back after it tomorrow, and hopefully he can get rolling a little bit. But let's not forget, he's coming off an injury in which he missed, 80% of the season or whatever it was last year. So let's see where that goes. I don't think anybody should be panicking in that regard.
We got a question over the text line from the 816. My friend always brags about how much money he makes, but is yet to pay me for a tournament bracket. Should I call him out?
Well, the tournament's not over. Yeah.
I think when the tournament is over.
So tomorrow's the day.
Someone says he's already sent a couple of Venmo requests. I mean, then you've already made your point.
Now, typically, look, like fantasy football is what you got before week one starts in fantasy football. I need your entry fees. It's just fair. That's just how this goes. Sure. So this guy should have absolutely before the tournament started
paid the money.
So I guess you're fine, but. You know, should you freak out yet? Tomorrow's when I'm like, hey, man, the whole tournament's been completed and you still haven't paid me for the entry. Is he doing well or is he doing bad?
The guy's doing bad.
Because if he's doing well, then it's pretty simple.
It took you a full year to get paid $10 from Bob Fesco over a tournament bracket.
A couple years ago, we did
it. It might have taken a full 12 months.
I think a couple years ago. I don't know if it was a whole year, but it was the bracket thing we did as a station.
And then someone tried to come to me for money and I told them I quit. We did a player draft before a tournament. I made a trade, and then everyone told me I couldn't do it, even though it wasn't in the rules.
Yeah, to me, once you commit to the draft process, then you're locked in for the entry fee. Like the Fantasy Baseball League that we did like a week ago, we drafted. I made everybody pay right before the draft started. That way, if you have a bad draft, you can't back out. It's like you agreed, you're in the league, you entry fees before the draft starts. I feel like that's how most fantasy football, and as it's definitely gotten even darker outside.
Meanwhile, while you guys are having issues with that, I'm paying people to take my couch.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's not good.
Well, they didn't take your couch. At least they only took your $100. Because then you could still sell your couch. We got to have that gentleman into Club 610 soon. Do you got contact information?
We're gonna work on finding a day for him to also get Royals tickets, to go to a game. That also is part of the deal as well.
We'll work on our Royals ticket request for...
There's another thing that we have somebody coming in for Club 610 for, correct? Is that the bracket winner? Is that what they get?
Yeah, that's part of it.
Correct. Mm-hmm. They can come in together. Have them in
at the same time.
Sure.
If that
listener
works out.
Club 610. I'm telling you, I'd like to do a poolside one this year. The nicest pool we can get
somebody
into.
Somebody did suggest.
Which rich listener is going to let us do a show by their house in the dead of summer?
We're just randomly. We're in listener Brian's backyard. It's a beautiful pool. That's what you want?
Yeah. Like, sitting up to chest deep, headphones on. Some beers on the little floaty, calling it a day. We're listener Brian's backyard pool. It's got to be a nice pool. I'm looking. This is only about
we've
nicest
gone through the
pool
website.
We can get to.
Remember, there's the website.
Oh, I know that you can Airbnb pools.
Yeah, it's I can't remember. We looked this up like 2 years ago. Swimply. It's called Swimply. You can book pools by the hour. We've Googled this and searched this before. This is definitely
but maybe there's just a listener who'd like us to come over,
Let's see, like
people
Friday, June 7th. Seems like a great weekend. Let's see what pools are available in the area.
It's a very specific day.
I just randomly picked, current location. We'll just do any area.
What'd you find?
Let's see. Hold on. Oh, one guest, two, three, four, five guests. Let's see. What are we running here? $40 an hour? Is that what that says? There's a... perfect poolside paradise at Overland Park. $40 an hour. Ooh, this one
is
even
nicer. Is there a better one than that?
$75 an hour. Beautiful tropical experience in Olathe, this one says.
Mm. Okay.
There's a couple really nice ones, man.
I gotta be honest. This Riverside one, you're asking $80 an hour for this?
This one's an above ground pool. I'm not paying for an above ground.
Here we go. Four Palms, salt heated pool. Like, now we're talking. It says 2 hours maximum. Oh, 2 hours minimum. Oh, okay. Well, then great.
Well, you need it for 4 hours.
Well, minimum. That's all. I thought it was maximum.
We need 4 hours.
$75 an hour. It's 16 feet by 32 feet. Nine feet on the deep end.
9 feet. So during breaks, you can jump off the diving board.
That's right.
Or whatever.
Yeah, every break, we'll just jump into the pool. That sounds like a plan.
Now people are just complaining about the people who have superiority complex. Somebody invited us to their public pool because they said... people in the HAO board are always complaining about non-members using it. I'm not even kidding. I worked with someone once. As we're getting close to wrapping the show,
and the eclipse. The world's about to end. It's getting really dark outside.
I worked with someone once who he thought people were coming to his neighborhood pool who were not members of the neighborhood.
Which is what you're trying to do.
Correct. But he called the police. And I'm like, what are you doing? You can't call the cops on people using a neighborhood pool, even if you don't think they're there. Didn't you see that viral video of that lady sitting on her phone? Just don't call the cops on people for trying to use a pool.
Right. Yes.
Especially if I'm in the pool. Please don't do that.
You don't need to elevate it to that level. I would agree with that.
Someone's offering their cousin's pool. Your cousin's pool. So their parents have a pool in their backyard. Not the fanciest, but absolutely a great spot for Club 610. Pergola.
Can we address this one text finally? Because there's one text, and this individual, I'll give him credit, for the last 2 weeks has texted in asking Drew to book us at the Kansas City Zoo.
Yeah, somebody has been going after it.
And so I've seen this. Now, do you work for the zoo? I'm just confused. There's the same text has been coming in for 2 weeks. I'm cool with doing. I haven't seen the new aquarium. I would love to see the new aquarium. But I'm just wondering, does this person actually work at the zoo? What's the infatuation with us doing the show at the zoo? I'm fine with the zoo.
Yeah, I would do a show at the zoo.
Absolutely would. I'm just this. We keep getting the same text. I don't know if this person actually works.
It has been coming in for.
But the new aquarium I heard is awesome. And it's something I would like to see. Have you gone out to the new one at the zoo? Have you gone out to the new aquarium?
No.
Drew, you probably haven't been to the zoo yet because
we did go to the zoo, but it was on a Saturday. It was so busy that we did not we skipped the aquarium because it was.
I feel like the show at the zoo could be fun.
I think it was shortly after they. It was shortly after they opened it. I think is when we went, and it was obviously the highlight feature of the zoo. So it was packed.
But
we did not go in.
I have a good zoo contact.
Okay.
From the time that we reached out and I tried to get them to name a monkey Furious George, and the response I got was the monkeys are kind of partial to their own current names, so we're not going to rename them. But as a result of that, I am familiar with the media director. I want to do a show at the zoo, but only if it means we get to feed the lions or something cool.
Feed the lions?
Yeah, I want to get in. My guess is
you can't do that.
Why? Someone has to feed them.
I don't think they're going to let you feed the lions. Out of all animals, you pick the lions.
Is it the aquarium or is it the aquarium?
Or the penguin area, which is obviously one of the most fun.
It's either penguins or just the brand new beautiful aquarium that they've built.
So.
You have to reserve, apparently, to get to the aquarium. That was right. That's why we didn't go. You had to reserve to get into the aquarium. You had to reserve like a time because it's so log jammed that they didn't want to just open it up.
Oh, the guy texting and says, no, I don't work at the zoo. I'm the meat cutter. I'll be at the zoo when you guys go. No, that's the guy that does the meat cutting competitions.
Oh.
I don't know if he works at Roadhouse or whatever. We brought up Texas Roadhouse, the great rolls. Yeah. And he's like, hey, I do meat. He does meat cutting for them. And he's they had some competition nationwide.
I think a show at the zoo would be fun.
I'm in.
Seems like everyone wants
to show at the zoo during the eclipse. That could happen.
Let's take Club 610 on the road this year. You know,
summer tour.
Someone's pool, the zoo, somebody Friday. Who runs like a cigar and whiskey shop offered us their place for a Club 610 up in the Northland. We could take Club 610 on the road this summer. Nothing's stopping us from moving around. The only problem with that is Drew is just hanging back.
I would be here.
You and I are going. Can we get him to one out of every four?
We can alternate, maybe not alternate, but yeah, we can maybe
find a couple that he can make it to.
I'll go to the zoo one. I'd like to go to the zoo one. That'd be fun.
Are you going to time lapse this later, Gold, so we can slowly see your face coming into focus?
I don't know if I'm going to do that, but I'm assuming it's adjusting because it clearly you can admit, right?
Yes, it is now.
We are at probably what
near to
75%, 80% now because it's going to end up being 89% here in 4 minutes.
So, yeah,
it's getting much darker than this.
I bet you guys are really moved by our verbal description.
This whole thing starts since 10 o'clock this morning. Cody is clearly very annoyed that we've talked about the eclipse today. If we go back to the 10 o'clock hour, you've made smart-ass comments about it throughout the entire show.
I have made smart-ass comments. I'm not annoyed that we're talking about the eclipse. I'm mocking the idea that a radio show is probably the worst place to listen to eclipse coverage.
We're not giving play-by-play of the eclipse. We're just talking about it.
It is literally the biggest story in the country today. I'm talking about
it
literally in this moment. I've got nothing against it. We definitely should talk about it. I'm just laughing. It's like a Parks and Rec reference. It is funny that a radio show would describe an eclipse, a very visual event. I'm enjoying the juxtaposition of that.
Yeah.
I told you, it's like a satellite radio Christmas tree lighting. It's usually something you want to see.
You
not
could provide some music, though, for people to listen to.
What do you got
to,
for us? Even if we're just dancing in the dark. Was this on the Eclipse playlist?
It was.
Huh.
Dancing in the Dark.
I feel like the best one, but...
Someone requested it. Was it Eclipse in the Heart or something like that? Yeah.
Total Eclipse of the Heart?
Total Eclipse of the Heart, yeah.
I mean, that is that two on the nose? There's like a line,
I mean,
right?
That one's definitely... I mean, it mentions Eclipse in the... That one's specifically for today, I feel like. It's perfect.
By the way, literally like 10 people have texted in offering us places to take Club 610 on the road. So if we just want to like bounce around places, we can be good to go. Problem is you got to have us there for 4 hours. You can't.
We're
the Club
there.
610 part is where we'll have the most fun. But for the first 3 hours, you have to have us there. So that's what matters. Feels like it like brightened up a little bit.
Is it over?
No, I don't think so, man.
2 minutes from I thought when it was, someone else says they think the tint on our windows are making it seem darker than it actually is. I don't know. We don't have the shade over it anymore. So
yeah, so the shades are pulled up.
Our actual normally windows are usually, dark. If it's sunny out, you can see right out. Usually they're not tinted. That's what it is outside, I think.
I mean, I'm sure it's more bright than it is in this studio, but it certainly seems pretty dark.
Yeah.
Huh.
Someone said, how did you not play Bad Moon Rising? That would
have
been
you had Bad Moon Rising? Did you have that one ready?
I did not have that one ready.
It's all good.
I had somebody had suggested Faded...
Fade to Black or
Fade
whatever.
To Black, and I listened to almost half the song, and at no point did I hear the words Fade to Black.
I don't think... I think
so.
Just,
I don't know. I think it's just the name.
Sometimes the name of the song don't have the lyrics. Sometimes they do.
So is this Club 610 Live from Drew's apartment leasing
office?
Could
you imagine we're just bagging them the whole time?
We get them all... We put them in the hot seat. We get the answers that we've been looking for.
They do have a pool there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but I mean...
I don't know.
Am I going to catch cholera in it? I mean, they're not even like fixing leaks in your place. How can I be sure that they're taking care of pool maintenance?
No, I don't think you can be sure.
At least I know with Gold's pool, when things go wrong, they close it.
They did, yeah. They always have some excuse why they can't open when they're supposed to open, though. Like the first time, then they're good. The first one, it's always like, oh, we didn't realize that this crack needed to be fixed. Like, you had 8 months. You just opened you just now found the crack. You know, stuff like that is always annoying.
There was one
the pool
point.
Should be open by Memorial Day weekend. I thought those were always the rules.
Even if it's too chilly, I just want to sit outside
Memorial
by
Day
the
weekend.
Water.
I thought that was just that's the given for every pool on earth. I thought Memorial Day weekend.
It did feel that way. Is this really 90%? This doesn't feel dark enough.
I mean, we got in 10 seconds. Yeah. So basically, this is as dark as it's getting. This is what happens when we're not at the path of totality. You know,
this is only 90%.
This is as dark it's gonna get. Now it's gonna go the opposite way. Starting now, it's 154.
Maybe okay. It's kind of a letdown.
Yeah.
The last one was cooler.
It definitely was. Oh, the last one, it got dark.
Yeah.
This was, okay, it's tinted. It looks like we just had tinted windows. It's true. That's what it looked like outside. Like we all just had tinted windows or sunglasses on. There you go. See you in 2044. Fake moon, right, Drew?
It's not me. It's my wife.
It's a government satellite. That's what blocks the sun.
Somebody just held a piece of paper slowly. Across.
That's right.
How it happened. All right, we're back at it tomorrow. We'll have JJ Piccolo, the general manager of the Royals, join us, get his perspective on this nice start to the season.